Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Alphacast. I'm Kyle, your host today.
Today you're the host.
Today I'm going
to
be the host.
That's why I know you're feeling pretty good today, because usually you're telling me to do it.
Yeah, well, I just felt good. Joining me, as always, is Ryan. We don't have last names.
Nope.
We're just Kyle and Ryan.
Like Prince.
Yeah. Today, we are going to talk about stuff.
It's an Alphacast.
And guess what we have today? Emails.
You want to start with that?
I'm not going to start with emails,
okay.
But we're going to have people wrote into us and ask us questions.
Yeah, so keep them coming. They're fun.
Honestly, every time we do this, it's usually late at night. Today, like one of my kids is sick, is coughing. I'm exhausted by the time we do this. I really don't want to half the time. Really just...
He does it for you.
Well, no, we plan on it. And then when the time comes, I'm just like, whatever, we'll do it. But when I was reading the email questions today at work, I actually got excited. I was like, this gives me something. It made me feel like this is going to be fun.
Yeah.
So
I felt the same.
Please write in with more shit. Even if it's just like, hey, talk about this person's butt. That's fine.
Yeah.
As long as it gives me something to talk
about. I'll talk about their butt. I like talking about butts.
Yeah. The email, as always, is going to be Alphacast.
Ifs and ands. Or,
why are you interrupting me?
Because I had a stupid joke about ifs, ands, or butts.
If, ands, or butts.
But I came a second too late.
Yeah, I like the ifs.
Go ahead.
Alphacast@alpharookie.com. That is the email address. Send your emails, discussions, topics, questions to that email address.
Are we ready? Are you going to take your video down now, or are you going to leave that up there definitely?
I don't know. I just leave it up there.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also social media, obviously, Twitter and Instagram.
Wherever they come from, I guess.
Alpha_rookie.
You could do that thing where like, no, we're going to go over to Twitter and see if they're, oh, there's
no,
nothing.
No, okay. I don't want to do that. Instagram's Alpha, only because Instagram, Alpha Rookie. When we want to ask you guys questions or like kind of gauge the interest of what you guys want or whatever, we don't have a really good way of communicating to you. We're not going to throw a video up just to say, hey, question. Like you said, I threw that dumb video up that was like, here's our email address. I don't want to have to create a video just to ask you guys a question. So follow us on social media so that you can get in contact with us and we can ask you guys shit too.
I was hoping somebody besides me told you like, actually, that music's pretty great and we should just actually use it for the podcast, but nobody said anything.
I'll put it in.
You should.
I'm going to.
Okay, good.
At this point, you're listening to it. You just heard music.
Yeah.
So.
Hey, I'm so glad you played that music.
Yeah. That was a song I made using, I think, like a bunch of loops from GarageBand back in like 2006.
Yeah.
So,
I forgot, bob my head a little bit.
At Blank Blank City College,
yeah,
Music 60, I took over the summer. I went to an actual university, but I took a few classes at a city college as well. So, yeah, I made that music.
I liked it.
Do you remember the King of Kong?
The documentary?
Yeah.
Yeah?
If you get the DVD, actually, I have the DVD. I should just bust it out and show it to you. The menu music sounds eerily similar to that song that I made. Now, I told one of my teachers that once, like, did you contact them? I'm like, no, you fucking idiot. I'm like, they just also use GarageBand and use the same loops that I did to make music, you know, but they sound very similar.
Right.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. All right, so today.
You also just use music from, like, Night of the Living Dead or Dawn of the Dead because it's all just library music anyway.
Oh, you're right, because that's not. Yeah.
Not all of it. I mean,
well,
like,
anything that's public domain.
The zombie stuff, like the original score stuff, no, but, like, you know. You know, when people go dun 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 dun.
For a while, I was like, I don't know what you're doing, but I finally got it. The mall music,
right? Like you can use that. Anybody can use that.
So
I think, Craig, we should have a corrections portion. You can tell us if I'm wrong.
Let us know. Heads up for today. What we're gonna be? We already have we actually have a list today of things that we're probably gonna discuss. We are going to talk about. We saw Arrival.
Yeah, I squeezed in all these movies. I didn't do shit for like weeks, and then somehow you and I ended up with like two or three things that we can actually talk about.
We watched Don't Breathe.
Yeah.
We're going to be talking about Don't Breathe. I finally watched Star Wars, the original trilogy, from beginning to end, which I've actually never done.
In your life?
I've watched A New Hope, the first one.
Mm-hmm.
I've watched that bits and pieces enough to watch the whole movie.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen Ewoks. I've seen Hoth.
The way you're talking about it makes this, you sound like Rucker Hauer in Blade Runner. Like, I've seen Ewoks. Like, I have seen things you can't imagine.
I've never watched those movies from beginning to end, so I watched the first three because I wanted to watch 7. Because
little baby Kyle looked at it and was like, this is stupid.
Well, the grown-up Kyle doesn't feel any different.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
So, so I'm going to talk a little bit about Star Wars and how much Star Wars is Star Wars.
That's going to be a big, long conversation.
As Danny O'Dwyer would say, fucking space wizards.
Space wizards.
And then, what else we got on the docket today? I'm going to talk a little bit about Steven Soderbergh today.
Okie dokie.
I'm thinking about making a video about something. And Death Stranding, I guess you wanted to talk about that.
I don't know. I don't know if I have a lot to say about it, but I haven't talked to you about it. It was an interesting trailer.
We'll talk a little bit about Sleeping Dogs, too.
Okay. I feel like there's some other news, since we're talking about news stuff.
No, well, it's stuff that's personal to me.
I mean, there's Last of Us 2. I mean,
I don't care about... Well, I mean, I care about that.
I care about that.
There's nothing to talk about. Right. Whatever. You'll see it. And then we're going to be, as we've mentioned before, next month of January, if you're listening to this in December. If you're listening to this at, like, next March, well, imagine it's December. imagine Christmas is on the way. It's the
imagine
holidays.
It's 2017.
Right now.
That's what I'm doing right now.
Yeah.
I just say it's almost 2017. It's almost 2017.
Which reminds me, I have to finish that Twin Peaks video before 2017 hits because we like very much say, like, hey, next, whatever. I'm working on a Twin Peaks video. I'm getting near the end of there. I'm actually almost done with the first part of part one of three. I'm almost done with that.
Well, I'm 5 minutes into a 25-minute AVP video.
Yeah. You need to.
I'm going to work on it all day tomorrow and Saturday.
You need to do some more. Stop being so. I don't want to say you're lazy. I don't want to, whatever. I know you're holidays and shit like that, but you need to do some more work. So we're going to be watching the Resident Evil movies in January because the last Resident Evil, I hope it's the last Resident Evil movie, comes out January 27th. So we'll be doing a Resident Evil movie podcast probably the 27th or 28th of January. So we'll be watching all the movies, and I'm going to be doing a playthrough of Resident Evil 2. We're going to record ourselves, me and you, watching me play, taking questions. If you guys have questions about Resident Evil, I'm a huge Resident Evil fan, like mainly the original three, but I mean, I've liked all of them up until 6 because 6 was garbage. I remember playing like Outbreak and the Survivor ones on the PS2. Like, I'm a big fan of Resident Evil. I don't like the movies that much, but I like the original shit, right? I mean, you do too. I played the fucking GameCube remake at your house until we realized we didn't have a memory card to save the game. So I stayed at your house until, like, god hours in the middle of the night trying to finish the entire playthrough of Resident Evil 1 on the GameCube. Drove all the way to my house to get a memory card, drove all the way back to your house, saved the game, and then never fucking finished it.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
By and large, you kind of introduced me to Resident Evil. I don't think I ever played any of the original games or remakes of them by myself. Four was the first thing to come out for me.
Right.
It was like an experience for me, and to this day is like, it's probably my favorite video game.
I played two when it was like I didn't go out and buy it the day it came out, but like a friend of mine had bought it. He'd had a PlayStation 1 and he had Resident Evil the Director's Cut, and then when 2 came out, it was like, oh, like someone went and got it, and then I like ended up borrowing it and playing it, you know, 800 times in a row. So one of the things is Resident Evil 2, you can beat it in under 2 hours. It's not hard to do. I've played it so many times and gotten so many A rankings in a row that we played it many years later. You were playing it. I was like, there's handgun ammo in that drawer over there.
Okay, I wouldn't have been able to get through that.
I'm like,
you've
got like custom handgun parts are going
to
be over there. Like, I still remember shit. So part of me playing through is going to be kind of funny to see how well I can do probably 10 years removed from the last time I played it.
Right. That's the funny thing is I think I could do that with somebody with Resident Evil 4.
That's also not that old. Either.
There's not as many secrets or whatever. But if somebody else was playing it, I'd be like, don't forget to go around the corner. There's a barrel over there, too, and there's probably some ammo in there.
Right.
I'd be able to do that also.
So, yeah, it's been about a decade since the last time I played it, and we're going to see if I can, we're in one sitting, we're going to try to blow through it and see if I can get an A ranking. I'm not going to play it on hard mode, though. I'm just going to play it on normal. I'm not, like, that.
Let's see.
Yeah, well, I don't think, those games are different. I played Resident Evil 4 on Professional. And I beat it, no problem. But those games are a little bit harder, a little bit different. So I'm just going to play it on normal, see if I can get an A ranking.
What's like a hard mode for Resident Evil 2? They just like more bullets, less bullets?
I think it's just
More bullets to take a monster down and then less bullets they give you?
Less ammunition you're going to find, so it's going to be more, you know, survival, horror.
So it's less...
They do more damage, I'm pretty sure.
So they lean on you for the resource management and for making sure your shots count.
Yes, but
not getting hit.
Yes, but that's the thing is that's not the kind of game where you actually have the mobility to really
right.
So it's I don't want to be a masochist with that, you know.
Right, like, but if you're playing the survival horror game correctly, you're trying not to get hit very often.
In general.
Right. So I'm saying it's okay, but it's not like it takes longer to bring the enemies down or anything like that.
I don't think so.
Because like other games, you know, the enemies are tougher.
Yes, they increase their health and they make your health decrease. Yeah.
We've already gotten started.
Yeah, we have an emulator set up. I brought some brand new controllers. I bought some DualShock 4s, the new version of the models. They're like rubberized grips. They're a lot nicer. I use DS4 Windows program to like, you know, set the controls up and everything like that. That shit is amazing, by the way. You can change the light bar to any color you want. You can have it pulsate when it's charging. You can have it, like when I play on my PC now, I've been using the DualShock we'll get into video game talk right now. I've been playing Hitman. I waited till the whole like first season was done, and I've been playing Hitman, and it's because I like Metal Gear Solid 5 a lot. I like the sneaking and the taking guys down and planning and shit. So Hitman's a lot of fun. I was using my Xbox 360 controller on my PC. The run button is a left bumper. For some fucking reason, this controller works. I've never had any problems with it. If I hold down the bumper, and I've seen people online say the same thing, it's definitely like it's not making good contact. So he'll like kind of run and then stop and walk and then run and stop. And I'm like, what the hell's wrong with this game or what's wrong with my controller? So I ended up just buying the DualShock 4 and then everything works fine. So now I've been using the DualShock on my PC to play games. And when I play, it's like I can make the light bar blue. And as it starts to, the battery drains, it turns into red. So I can actually just look at the controller's light and see kind of where my battery percentage is without having to like, you know, go to a menu and see, oh, I'm at 30%. I'm like, oh no, it's turning red. It's getting low. But it's a gradual change from blue to red. It's kind of nice. Whatever. You don't care.
I don't. I don't like stealth games. I don't like controllers either.
I've had to try to get a PS3 controller working on a PC before so I could play on my Media Center PC that you've seen. Like, I have like Super Nintendo games I play with my kid and shit. I have a wireless PS3 controller. It took a lot of work to get that one set up correctly, and I tried to do it again for this Resident Evil 2 playthrough on my other computer that I'm going to record on, and it was just like, dude, I don't remember how to do this, or I'm not going to do Bluetooth. I want to plug it in, but if I plug it in, it only wants to do Bluetooth, and it was complicated. And there's different programs out there to try to help. So I said, fuck it. DualShock 4 seems like they have a better driver set up for it. DS for Windows works like a fucking charm. So
you're like Morgan Freeman in Batman. You're just like, I just wanted you to know how hard it was.
Yeah. Everything in my life is hard. Every project I take on ends up being some kind of like, oh, there's 50 steps that I now have to figure out because this doesn't just work when I plug it in. But I do IT for a living. It's kind of what I'm used to. It's the way everything fucking works. So yes, look forward to a playthrough of Resident Evil 2. I'm going to play as Leon because I don't want to play with the fucking crossbow. If I play as Claire, she has like a crossbow, I think.
Yeah.
I want the shotgun. I want the magnum. The
crossbow is kind of cool in Evil 5. Within, though.
Oh, yeah. No, that the Agony crossbow, is that what it's called? It has Agony bolts.
I like that game.
Yeah. Anyways, okay. Enough of that shit.
Okay.
Let's get into today.
All right.
Let's talk about Arrival.
Okay. Let's do it.
Now, I don't really know how the rules is going to work, but I'm going to should I put a timer on my phone? I don't want to spoil it for anybody that hasn't seen it. Like, hey, we're going to talk about it for the next 5 or 10 minutes, or what should we do?
Well, people might want to hear about it, like, non-spoiler, so why don't we just kind of say,
I don't see how we could talk about the movie.
We can talk about your impressions of it or whatever, and...
Oh, it's really good.
Okay,
now let's get to the point that has all the spoilers.
Okay, well, I don't know, what, 10 minutes?
I'm gonna put a 7-minute timer. I think that's enough for us to talk a little bit about it and ask some questions of each other, right?
Okay.
All right, let's put the timer. That's my nap timer. I gotta change that. 8 minutes. So if you're listening to this and you want to skip over... Actually, no, this isn't going to work because when I truncate some of the silence off this podcast...
Ah, it's going to be a
different 8 minutes
time.
Is going to change, so...
Mm. What are you going to do?
So for about the next 5 to 10 minutes, we're going to talk about Arrival. So if you don't want to hear it, just skip 8 or 9 minutes and see if we're talking about something else. All right, ready, set, go. We're going to talk about Arrival for like 20 minutes. Forget the 8 to 10 because we went way too long, so... I'm going to put this part back in the beginning.
Wow, good luck with all that cutting and pasting.
Yeah, exactly. So maybe 20 minutes some Arrival talk and then something else. All right. So Arrival. I liked it. Did you like it?
Yeah, I liked it.
Did you cry?
No, I didn't cry.
I cried. My wife cried.
When did you cry? Like at what part of the movie did you cry?
Partly in the beginning.
Just like right at the beginning?
Right at the beginning.
Okay.
The very end.
This is parent stuff.
Yes, absolutely. I was just going to say, this isn't going to make you cry. It's not like some great emotional movie. It's that if you have kids.
I was crying. I'm like, because you have children.
Well, also because my wife's brother.
Okay. Oh.
My wife's brother passed away 2 years ago. Actually, coming up, his anniversary of his death is like next month.
Right.
He's actually, well, I don't want to talk about it because I don't want anyone to know who we are, but I'll tell you later.
Okay.
So it was kind of hard on us because there's a lot of, like, you see things in it that not just conjure up feelings, but a lot of the same.
Would that be true of any movie that was just kind of dealing with?
No.
Like a, okay.
It was very much like the idea, I mean, because we're going to spoil the movie, it's the idea of being able to see this kind of future and mm-hmm. the past, and if would you still make the decision if you could, and
right.
kind of like what goes with it, and it's just super fucking depressing. Not depressing in a bad way, it is very cathartic to mm-hmm. get that out, you yeah. know, but, yeah, it was. I was getting kind of choked up over stuff because the parent part in me.
Yeah.
But then I looked over at her and I realized like she was actually crying.
Right.
And then I had tears in my eyes too. Like we were crying. So, if you have any like loss in your family or you are a parent, Arrival is a very sad movie, but not sad, sad, like depressing.
In case you just thought it was about, like, aliens, I guess.
There goes a helicopter right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's...
Because you can see from the trailer, you know, you just think that maybe all you're in for is...
Yeah, no, it's a very emotional movie. It's very personal to me.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, it's a very personal movie.
That's the interesting thing about it. Yeah, you're right.
It's I mean, it is about all this other stuff, but it's really, really about her. You know, it never stops being
but
about
even,
the
like,
character.
No matter what, like, anyone who watches this, you guys could walk away with it feeling something totally different
right.
than what we have. So go ahead and kick it off. Like, what?
Sure. So The Arrival is about a...
It's just called Arrival, I think.
Is it? Because I get it mixed.
I keep saying about Arrival,
but
it's not.
The joke is, what's his face? Charlie Sheen movie.
The Arrival, right?
Is that The Arrival? That's Arrival with an article, The?
I don't know. You're right, though.
Okay, but there's another movie called Arrival or The Arrival with Charlie Sheen where the aliens come here and they're the ones that are causing global warming so they can come live here.
Is that the one where, like, the legs bend backwards?
Yeah. That's the one where an alien thinks the best way to kill Charlie Sheen is just put a bunch of scorpions on top of his ceiling fan and just kind of hope that they... like land on him. I
haven't watched that in a really long time. I don't remember any of this.
Anyway, so Arrival by Denis Villeneuve. Okay, it's the guy who did Sicario, an enemy, which I haven't seen.
Sicario was really good. And Prisoners was really good.
I haven't seen Prisoners yet.
Is that the one with Jake Gyllenhaal?
Yeah.
Yes.
No, that's Enemy.
I don't know which one's which, but I watched both of those, and one of them is really good.
Maybe he's in Prisoners too. I don't know.
Hugh Jackman?
Okay, maybe.
I
haven't seen that movie.
Okay,
I've only seen Sicario in those.
All right, you only got 5 minutes. Go.
Okay. Oh shit. so you have your main character Amy Adams, who plays one of like the world's leading linguists.
Yes.
Okay. And in the midst of her just going about her life, an alien invasion happens. But it's not like what you've seen in movies before, where it's like an invading force or. You know, anything like that. It's just these 12
pods,
12 like monolithic kind of nondescript.
I mean, this is the trailer you're describing. Yes, they're floating around the world in a couple of spaces in a lot of different countries.
And they don't know how to talk to them.
Right.
None of the world's governments know how to talk to them. So the American government,
sends a team in to try to communicate,
including
with them.
Amy Adams, and that's the premise of the movie.
Yeah. So. The thing
it's
with,
a movie about communication.
Yes, and it's a very, very good. I mean, we're both college educated. This is very much like here's how a scientist approaches a problem versus here's how like a regular person might approach it. It feels a little elitist, but for someone who feels that like, no, I would make qualified, not decisions, but you know, I would think about what I'm going to do. I would process these steps. I would try to approach it from this way. And then you have the fight back from like the military and from the people who are, just fucking bomb them.
Right.
You know, or that kind of shit. It's one of those things where like, it's almost like a zombie movie. What would you do in this situation? And it frustrates you sometimes. You're like, oh, why don't you try this? Why don't you do this? You know, from my mind, I'm a very algorithmic kind of person. Here's the steps you would follow. That shit actually feels really good to watch someone be really intelligent and solve a problem, I guess, in a very smart way.
Right. So it was an interesting perspective because, again, other alien movies, you're like, it's okay. So, yeah, a physicist or a mathematician or a military person, or it's a fight. Or
why
you know,
is Jeremy Renner there?
He figures something out. Remember his whole thing with he came up with the 12 or whatever it was, the number.
Yeah, it's like the code. But like he was like basically like Sheldon Cooper from Big Bang Theory. Like he's like, I'm a a theoretical physicist. Why are you here?
Yeah.
You don't have nothing to offer this, but he's just really smart.
Right. Okay, so you want to keep going? You want to pick this
running
up?
Running out of time. So, okay, questions I have. Okay, when it comes down to communicating, what the fuck are these things? They're just like a big hand with a big lump on top?
Well, they show them. There's the one time where they bring her inside.
Right.
And you see one full, all of them.
Right.
Because before, all you could see was the hand part. So they're heptapods. So they have seven, or five, sorry, excuse me. Wait, what is hep?
Hep seven.
Hep seven. So they have seven limbs things.
Pentagon five.
Right. Hepta.
Maybe it's
hepta.
Six. Maybe hepta
it's
six.
Just like we don't have a hepta anything fucking thing here.
Hexagon is six,
like,
so hepta, yeah.
Whoever does a seven anything. Like
it's an odd number.
I never use it. Anyway.
Literally, it's an odd number.
They look like giant. They look like a humongous. You know what they look like? They look like the Reapers in Mass Effect.
They do. Okay, so they kind of just materialize out of smoky mist.
They seem to.
And at the end of the movie, when the pods go away, they just kind of dissolve into smoky mist.
They just have technology that we don't understand.
Okay.
That's all. It was an artistic choice to do something that's like, I don't know how they did that. it would have been the same thing as like, how many movies have you seen where the space invaders leave and they just like a light flash warp zone
but
thing?
But that makes sense. Right, this because was like, were they even there?
Because movies taught you that.
Right. But it's like
we've never actually seen that happen ever in real life.
But the idea of like, oh, I just, you know, time warped away. But it's just like, were they ever there in the first place? Were they just made up of air?
I honestly think the filmmakers just said, like, what's something that people haven't seen before that would be weird?
The language. The whole point, the whole spoil of this movie is that as she learns, and she makes a speech about it at some point where she's like, the more you start to encase yourself in a language and you start to change, like the idea of, do you think in Spanish?
Right.
Do you think in Russian? Do you think in English?
Yeah, this is a thing.
Even if you're bilingual or trilingual, what does your brain think when you actually say words in your head? She starts to learn the language so well that she's starting to actually, I guess,
think like a heptapod.
Think like them, right? And that's how she gets her magical powers to look through time. And live, she's actually living in like multiple
times.
She can
see
all the same time.
So you never read Slaughterhouse-Five, huh?
No.
You know what it is though, right? You've heard of it? Really?
I've heard of it, but
okay, do you know who Kurt Vonnegut is?
Yeah, he was the guy.
Okay, you should read Slaughterhouse-Five. Slaughterhouse-Five is about a guy who...
Is it like Joe Budden and Royce to 5'9 and stuff?
What?
Oh, God.
What the fuck is that?
Come on, dude.
Did you say Joe Biden and what?
Joe Budden,
idea what you're talking about right now.
Slaughterhouse. The rap group.
Oh, okay.
There's four of them.
Fuck me for knowing the great literary book and not the rap group. Sorry.
Well, you listen to Run the Jewels and shit. I would imagine you would listen to Slaughterhouse. They're a very lyrical group. They're Eminem's like...
Like the Purple Mountains song?
No, they're not D12.
Okay.
They actually used to have a beef with D12. They're other rappers... Well, sorry.
It's turning into a new podcast.
God. Royce the 5'9 is also from Detroit. Him and Eminem made a song together, a couple songs back in the day that are really good. And then they kind of got a little bit of beef between them. But like Joe Budden's from New York or Jersey. King Crooked, or he changed his name, is Crooked Eye. He's from Long Beach.
Oh, okay.
Like he's, you know, from here. And then the other guy, Joel Ortiz.
From where?
Hey, we've already mentioned Long Beach before. It's not a big deal.
Long Beach, New York. Long Beach, wherever. Long Beach,
and then
like...
Joel Ortiz is from New York, Brooklyn, or something like that. Queens. I don't fucking know. But yes, they're a rap group and they're very lyrical.
Okay.
And there's four of them, but Eminem would make a fifth member if they were to do something. So they were Slaughterhouse.
Anyway.
Oh, my God. You have 30 seconds left. Go.
That book is about a guy who, his word for it is, I come unstuck in time. And, like, he has a thing where he got, like, abducted or, like, meets aliens, and he's a World War II soldier. And his whole thing is that, like, time is not linear.
Yes.
Time is a thing. It's like a tapestry. If life was something that you could look at, it wouldn't be like a movie. It would be like a thing you saw all at the same time, like a painting.
Yeah.
He would just like bounce all between his, you know,
which is really hard to comprehend because it's like, are you living them simultaneously? Are you going back and forth between them? Because even when she started doing it, she was like, where am I?
Right.
What's going on? But then I think she figured it out.
Well, that's going to be my question to you is when she... I'm going to just call it unstuck in time in the future.
Was she having dreams that she thought she was dreaming something?
Well, no, because she was they're memories. So
that's
the idea. Like the way you treat memory right now is completely linear. So your memories are from things that are from things that past, right? You can't have memories of the future because that's our linear tunnel view of time.
But the idea, if you were having memories that you haven't had yet, they would feel like it'd be like dreams. Like you'd be having a dream about yourself that something that didn't happen, but you'd wake up going, that was weird. That felt,
I mean,
you
this
know.
Is a hard thing to talk about because I don't know what the sensation of that is because you and I don't know what it feels like.
That's the really
But this
about
isn't
this
like
movie.
A new idea, you know, like physicists and all that kind of stuff have talked about these things before.
But she's having them before she has the power to actually, like you said, live in the tapestry.
Which is the
So
okay.
it's like she's having dreams
there is,
that are things that are going
you have,
to happen.
You have to
but
be
she's,
careful about how much you poke this stuff because it runs in a paradox or
time paradox. Time
paradox stuff, just like Terminator does, just like everything does. Because if you go, okay, so if she remembers a future memory where the Chinese general is obvious to me anyway, like it was obvious that like he could see that she hadn't had that memory yet and he gives her the memory.
Right.
Because it's impossible for again, it's a paradox.
Yes, but I'm not trying to go that hard science into it. It's just the idea that like
well then what do you want to know about it?
Nothing to know. It's really well done because it does something that the Steven Soderbergh thing I want to talk about. The idea that she's having these memories.
Mm-hmm.
It sets it up to make you think that she lost her daughter.
Right. So this
But that's actually something that's going to happen to her.
Right.
But she's living these, she's having these dreams, which are memories of the future.
Right. And she says, who is this girl that I'm.
Which is
seeing?
Like blows me fucking away at that point. Yeah. It's like, wait, I don't get what's going on now.
Right. So, I mean, I would just think of it as like you're seeing flashes of the future. Like she's just like in Star Wars.
Right.
Right? Like you're seeing a vision. right? I'll tell you something funny. So
we're so over the time.
Yeah, whatever. My girlfriend and I went to go see that movie, and I must have been tired, or I'm just an idiot in general, because we like got out of it, and I was like, "Oh, that's so nice. She decided to have another daughter." that's so good. She opened her heart back up.
That's one of the bad the things with this movie. There's two things that it screwed up. It kept showing that girl different ages.
Yeah.
So when she asked her, "Who's this girl?"
Right.
I didn't think it was the same one.
Yeah, that's what I thought too. But I also don't think that was unintentional. I like movies that mess with you. I mean, that's obviously what the intention. The movie wanted you to think that there was this daughter and she was depressed because
she had lost her child. Yes.
Right. And then like I'm talking it out with my girlfriend and I'm thinking about it, okay, I guess there wasn't technically anything in the back half or in the first act of the movie that explicitly shows that that's what it was. When she talks to her mom and she's like, "Oh, you know, I'm same as always." Like, she could just be lonely.
Yeah.
You know, it has nothing to do, like, but she's in that big empty house. I'm like, okay, yeah, so she's in a big empty house. So what? You know?
Well, yeah, once it kind of all, like, kind of unveils itself and unravels, and it really hits home when she hugs Jeremy Renner, she says, "I've missed this," or she's like, I forgot how good it is to hug you.
Yeah.
But it's actually their first time.
Right.
That was a really powerful, like, bravo.
Yeah.
You did it. Like, that was a good...
Yeah, I wish I had understand what the movie was doing at that point. Experienced it.
I was like,
literally, she when she says, like, "I know why my husband left me," my brain was still in like, oh, she knows why. Wow. Her first husband left her.
I can't believe you fucked it up so bad.
I'm just a total fucking idiot.
That was like the dawn moment where I went like I said, this is it's not a masterpiece, but it's a masterpiece of filmmaking.
Yeah,
like this belongs in like, here's how to do it good.
Yeah.
That was a really,
really
hard
thing to convey, like a nuanced thing like that, like, yeah. Oh, time is not linear. That's a very difficult thing.
I'll admit, I was also, when she said that, she's like, "I forgot how it felt. I feel a hug you." I'm like, I don't, it took me a little bit to kind of, all get me, but I was, yes, it was there. And then, but then there was a part when the daughter was playing with the Play-Doh and she was making the character, like,
right.
She made the heptapod and the stuff that was happening in the present.
Right.
And I'm thinking, does she fucking dream all this shit up? Like, is it that her kid was playing with something and she saw the toys? And now she's dreaming up this whole
thing. No, I think they've seen pictures of, you know, like that stuff would be in history
right,
books
but
and stuff by then.
He does such a good job of mixing these times up that it confuses you just enough, but it doesn't go like, it doesn't do M. Night Shyamalama Ding Dong shit where it's like, hey, there's a big twist at the end.
Hey, just in case you just check back in, we're still talking about Arrival. Okay. one last thing, how stupid I am, because you're thinking we get left. So like there's the part also where she's like talking to her daughter and she's like, "Why did dad leave?" Like that thing.
Yeah.
And he's like, "Well, I told him something she wasn't ready to hear," that thing. And then he's like, "What?" And he's like, "Oh, like a disease, this thing." And I'm just like, oh, something horrible happens where a bunch of people get sick in the future. It's like an apocalypse, and then he couldn't handle it. Like, that's where my brain was going.
I don't know. You're a smart person.
I'm only telling you because, like, I don't typically do this with movies. But
you are way more analytical than me. You get stuff that I don't get all the time.
I was way, way, way off. Yeah. But I mean, I was just caught up in how pretty it was and just letting the movie sweep me along. And
so that's where, like, the tears come from. This is the idea that she knows full well that if she has this child.
Yeah.
It's like a cystic fibrosis kind of issue. Like, she's going to die at like 16 or 17 of like cancer or something. And it goes to that, it's better to have loved and lost than to have never loved at all, you know? Yeah. He took it as like, I can't believe you knowingly had a daughter with me, knowing that she's going to die before she's like 20. You're going to put me through that.
Right.
And that, you know, she's like, my dad's becoming more distant. Even though like he still loves me. I think what it is, he's trying to, you know, prevent himself from feeling that hurt.
Right.
That was very, very, very emotional for me. It scares the shit out of me. I've had my best friend growing up, his older sister got married. He had a nephew. And they would come, they were younger, much, much younger than us. They would come over to the pool and they'd play. Like, I remember a little Kyle and I don't remember what the other one's name was, but they were little kids. He ended up getting cancer at like 5. Mm-hmm. And he fought cancer for like 4 years. Like he'd get rid of it and he'd go into remission and have it again. I think it's somewhere like 9 or 10. I guess he just told him he just gave up. He's like, I just don't want to do this anymore. And he let himself die.
Yeah.
And he died at like 10 or 11. And it's super fucking depressing. I have a 4-year-old and a 1-year-old, right? It's like, oh, they're healthy now. Once you get past the baby and they're born and like first year, okay, good. They're healthy. Dude, anything could hit.
Yeah.
Anything could hit in the next year or two, 3, 5, 10 years, anything.
Right.
Watching that movie like scared the shit out of me.
Yeah.
And it fucking depressed me, but not in like a depressing way, but more of like, I have so much love for them.
Right.
And it's so scary.
So would you want
I don't. That's what we talk
it, to like appreciate that stuff more. If that was like,
I don't know if I could do that. If like I knew he was going,
you wouldn't. You would, because then the alternative to that, obviously, the point of the movie is that you don't want to end up to you don't want to end up at the end of that and then have regrets.
Right.
Right.
Absolutely.
Like about, you know, that's the whole thing.
I don't know. That's all. I don't know how I would live.
The theory of the movie is that if everybody could see the world the way the heptapods do and Amy Adams does,
yeah,
we would no longer not appreciate the time that we have,
right?
Because you would know,
yeah.
Like you would, there would be no more regrets. You would do what you whatever you could to appreciate what was happening.
I mean, quite frankly, if that was to happen to him, like, I honestly don't know how I would live. Like, I don't know how. Like, I would, like, where the red fern grows. Like, I'd be like the dog that lost another dog, and I would just slowly go off
God,
and
this
die.
That's the saddest fucking thing ever.
Right?
I haven't thought about that movie in, like, 15 years.
Book.
I mean, that book.
Yeah. That's something that's very much a thing that, you know, that it made me nervous, but it makes me appreciate. So, like I said, it's you can take it your own way.
Yeah.
It's a very powerful movie.
We're still talking about Arrival.
It's a very powerful movie. It's like we're seeing the other one thing that did really wrong, and I need to ask you because I was like, "What the are you?" The music. There's about two or three times when they're going into the room with mm-hmm. the glass, where it just blah.
Yeah, it was kind of weird.
And I was like, "Are they making noise? Are they like massive?"
Sometimes they'd be making noise,
right? Because
no,
sometimes
I think they're doing the Inception like shock and awe.
But it was
sound
right
design.
Before it was bad. Because
yeah.
it made it look like they were talking.
Yeah.
And kind of like a reaver in Mass
right.
Effect.
Yeah.
It happened like two or three times, and I was just like, that was... And then there was like music, if you remember, at the end of The Mist.
Yeah.
Like, it's like there's like singing all of a sudden at the very end right. of that movie, and you're like, it out of left field.
Yeah.
I'm like, what is this? There's a part in that movie where the two times where the music kicks in, and I'm like, this is the wrong music choice. This is like silly-ass music.
Yeah.
It was trying to be emotional. It like falls so much on its face.
Also, I think my favorite line is... Costello is in death process.
Yes, that's right. So my wife asked the question, if you were to, because she wrote the book on it,
uh-huh.
the universal language, she
yeah.
writes this book and she's
theoretically
like teaching
it. Changes humanity, that's the idea.
Does that mean anyone who like reads this book and learns the language, do they become
that's the idea
time travel powers?
That's why that the gift of the aliens to us.
But not just her. She's able
no,
to give it to everybody else?
Because as long as you have the codex, like
yeah.
they essentially... I don't know enough about history, but there's the thing where we found the Rosetta Stone,
yeah.
right? It's that. That's essentially what it is. So anybody can learn this language if they want to, and obviously with its... The cynical part of me is then like, oh, and then there were going to be gatekeepers with the language, and who gets to learn the language?
That's
who doesn't
what
get
I'm
to
wondering,
because you know,
like, everyone has this power to kind of like see throughout time. All how
right.
does that? That's where you poke hole. Like, how does that work? But is
I don't know
the idea that everyone's going to get this power eventually.
Right. I mean, the idea is that the heptapods, like, you know, had it and they have a whatever.
But did they just want to share it with her so she would help humanity? But like, is she
no,
going to
do it
to everybody
else? They explicitly state that they're doing it because they'll need our help in 5,000 years.
3,000.
3,000.
Yeah.
In the sequel.
Yeah. Arrival 2.
Arrival 2.
Arriving again.
Yeah.
It's a good movie.
It is really good. I thought, this is what I did. I said, oh, look at all, this is so great. All these like hopeful, optimistic science fiction movies like Arrival and The Martian.
And that's it.
I can't gonna think of another one. But that was
Interstellar.
No, Interstellar. I mean, like things where people don't die. Like Interstellar still has like nasty Matt Damon in it, and like, you know, there's still like some darkness. Fucking
spoiler
half
alert.
Half of them die. Whatever. Fucking.
No, I'm just joking because that
like,
was
no.
That was a really good. Fucking Matt Damon's in this movie. What?
Yeah. I mean, the only person that dies in the Arrival is the alien. Really.
Yeah.
And Ditto in The Martian, like nobody dies. Like it's a movie about literally like here's a thing,
and that
and
is
we
some,
solve the problem.
That is some timing with the election and with yeah. those guys who decided to go a little rogue there.
Speaking of Steven Soderbergh,
okay, we're done on
yeah,
Arrival.
Yeah, I know, I'm done on Arrival.
No,
but
obviously,
but I'm gonna segue on your Steven Soderbergh thing.
We went like way long. Hold on.
All right, you ready for the segue?
I guess.
Okay. So another movie that I kind of thought of. It's not. A lot of people die in this movie, but it's another kind of, it's not quite science fiction, but it's another movie where it's like, here's this huge, like, insurmountable problem, but it's a movie about, no, humanity can handle it.
Pacific Rim.
No, Contagion.
Yeah.
Which I only saw the one time, but like...
I've watched the movie so many times.
I remember being really struck by that. Like, I think a lot of people were. In fact, it's kind of a sad thing that maybe people don't remember that movie very much because it's not, like... You know, fucked up like
right.
The Road or whatever. You know,
that's
like, it was
very
a
much
about
a movie.
Fixing it.
If it's like late or like it's quiet or it's dark out, like in the winter time, and I'm like kind of like, oh, I just want to watch something, but I don't want to like.
Just you could bundle up and just pretend that everybody else is sick outside.
Well, Zodiac is a good movie to put on when you want to just relax and watch a movie, but you don't want to like have to watch an action movie or like watch some. Zodiac and Contagion are my two go-to movies for like, or if I'm sick and I'm sleeping on the couch, because I'm coughing real bad and I want to just leave a movie on while I'm like laying on the couch going to sleep.
Right.
Contagion, Zodiac, they're both really calming movies.
Right.
Even though they're about like really horrific things, they're directed in a way that's like they're nice and quiet, I guess.
And again, it's like. They're nice things to watch. Or you watch it, you're just like, it's too big, we can't handle it, we're all gonna die, right? Which is like kind of been the cinema for the last however many years. Like, I'm not the first person to have said it. Like, lots of people, you can tell what's going on in history by the kind of movies that we like to go see and make. So it's nice to see something like Contagion or, you know, where it's just like, this is impossible. Not going to say there won't be casualties,
right?
But we'll take care of it. Like it won't, you know. We'll get through
we
it.
We might set ourselves back a couple decades, but we won't. We're not going to. Yeah, that's the thing about like people think about, you know, with all kinds of shit with humanity, and like, we're not going to go extinct.
Yeah,
but a billion of us might die.
Yeah,
we might lose like a sixth or a seventh of the world's population, but humanity is going to continue living. You know, but that's also not that good. You know.
Okay, so Soderbergh.
I was watching a video on YouTube. You know. The world's premier site to get all the best information, YouTube. Joke.
It has been known.
Yeah. Anyways, I'm watching a video called... I don't know what it's called.
How do you spell that?
Yeah. I didn't write the title down. I wrote a title of a different YouTube video I was watching that I thought was really good. It's like dissecting the director.
Okay.
Dissecting the director.
Never mind. I was just when you said dissecting a director, I literally like imagined like a table? Naked Martin Scorsese on a fucking like mortician's table.
Should that just be the thumbnail? I'll just like take a picture. it's like dissecting the way he directs, and he uses Ocean's 12 as a very like his main examples.
And that's the one that had Matthew Kasavitz. Right or no? What's his name? That French actor,
Vincent Cassel.
Vincent Cassel. I said Matthew Kasavitz is the guy who directed Brotherhood of the Wolf, and that's why I thought because he's Vincent Cassel.
With Gerard Depardieu.
Is that how? I don't know. Is that how you say his name?
No, that's the other actor.
I don't remember his name. And what's his face from Iron Chef?
Mark Dacascos.
Mark Dacascos. Yeah.
All right. I am Omega.
But Vincent Cassel. That's the one. Vincent Cassel.
Yeah. Okay, and also that really famous guy.
I can't remember hardly anything about it. That's the one where they're like in Europe.
Yes.
Okay.
So that I'm thinking about doing a video on Ocean's 12 after kind of watching this. Not because of anything he said. That's my favorite of those three movies.
Mm-hmm.
Universally, that's the least favorite of those three movies. But what I think is amazing, if you like cinema, you like Steven Soderbergh, which I tend to like him a lot. And you watch those Ocean's movies, the way he's able to pivot off of, I mean, everything he's ever done before, directing and just being, I mean, he's never been like super fall in line Hollywood, whatever. But I mean, he's had mainstream movies.
That's the closest you've gotten.
But what I mean movies. Is like he's a household name in the idea that he's made movies that people have seen.
Right.
You know, you might not know who he is, but you've seen his movies.
Right.
He was able to make a movie that is so drastically different in style as an American filmmaker. I assume he's American. At least all of the other movies feel...
I think he is.
I mean, Soderbergh, I don't know.
Yeah.
But he made a movie that feels almost like it was made by it wasn't like a French movie. Because we've watched French movies, and holy shit, they're not like our movies. But it is not like an Americanized, I don't even know how to like put this into words, but the soundtrack is very European.
Mm-hmm.
The locations, obviously, very smart about the way they shot it. It's like the idea that if you were to shoot something somewhere in L.A., you have big open streets for car racing and shit like that. You go to Europe, you're like, oh, let's just emulate what we did here in another country, like what Fast and Furious would do.
Right.
They'll go around the world and do the same thing they could do in L.A. that they would do somewhere else.
Right.
There, it's like, no, they have narrow streets. No, their buildings are different. Like, you have to actually think about how you would make your movie because the geography is just different. The color grading, like, everything about that movie is amazing because it's not just Ocean's 11 in Europe. It's a completely different movie.
It's a European Ocean's 11.
Yes, made by an American, though.
Right.
There's so many good things about that movie. I just want to pick scenes out left and right. I'm like, oh my God, like when they get captured and they're being handcuffed and it's just music and silence. There's just the zooming shots of the camera from above. Like, there's all kinds of weird shit that he does in that movie that makes you feel like, oh, this is a totally non-regular American movie. And then you go back to Ocean's 13, feels nothing like that again. Feels like an American movie. Like, it's just the way the shots are shot,
mm-hmm.
you know?
I kind of remember people having these discussions.
And it's just sad that a lot of people shit on that, on 12, because it's just not as fun as 11 was. So like when 13 was made, it was like, hey, go back and make 11 again, mm-hmm. you know? But there's so much to like in 12. There's so much to appreciate from a filmmaking standpoint, especially for someone who made a high-profile, really successful crime caper movie and then makes this, which is just as good, but like people couldn't handle it because it didn't look clean.
Yeah.
It amazes me that that gets overlooked.
Right.
I'm not going to do it overlooked. I'm just saying, like, before you get any ideas.
This is kind of like, you know, when you like the Alien movies, you know, but that's what you get from different filmmakers. Whereas it's the same filmmaker, but just like.
And Alien Resurrection is a French ass French movie.
But you can tell when you watch it, right?
Yeah.
But like, imagine if, I mean, that would never happen. But,
but
like,
it's amazing it's the same director. It's actually, they didn't give the reins to somebody else. He actually changed everything enough to make it feel like they gave it to somebody else.
Right.
That's crazy. I mean, that's impressive.
Yeah, it's cool. It's like an exercise in style, you know. Comic book artists will do that. It's probably a lot easier for them. Like, a film director can't just be like, today I'm going to direct a movie and just see how it goes when I direct it this way.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Like, you typically, like, you build up your style and you only get so many movies to, like, solidify it, whereas a comic book artist can kind of be like, I'm going to draw a little bit like Jack Kirby today. All right, today I'm going to, like, I'm going to flex my muscles. I'm going to try to be a little bit more Alex Toth. That's not.
You've done the whole, like, I mean, like, not to shit on Jim Lee, but you're like, Jim Lee has a Jim Lee look.
Jim Lee has a Jim Lee
style. Does Jim Lee do anything that's not Jim Lee?
I mean, I haven't seen Jim Lee try to do anything that's
right.
not Jim
but
Lee.
But it'd be really
so.
Interesting if Jim Lee came out with something that was just like, whoa, that's.
Kinda, yeah.
You know?
Sort of. Like, yeah, that would mean he might be changing his style in kind of more idiosyncratic ways that I'm not appreciating, you know, like within his own whatever. But it kind of just seems like, you know, it's him.
Yeah,
but,
being able to step outside your own frame of reference,
right?
And,
I mean,
you know.
I'm not to keep going back to something I love, but whatever. Like Gorillaz, which we did a video. I did a video on an Overlooked video. That guy's art style changes pretty drastically. Like, there's three volumes of that.
It's like he get better as he goes along.
Well, he's. I don't know if he gets better. It's just that he's changing. It depends on what he's. He thinks he's getting better. He's he's developing as an artist. So like when he first starts, his stuff is very stark, clean lines. He's going for clarity, right?
Yeah.
And then his style starts getting a lot scratchier. And so what he's doing is he's trusting himself to become less controlled, and that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Because he's seeing. I only talk like that when I say I'm not an artist.
You're right.
But I'm friends with artists, right? And I
follow a lot of artists on Instagram.
No, I'm
artist adjacent.
I have a good friend who just draws every day, and when I see him, I look through his art book, and he's trying to find his style.
Yeah,
because he can draw like other artists. He can look at something else.
But you want to be able to make something like when you look at it, you go, "That's him."
Right.
Hey, if you ever want to look at some fucking weird shit,
right?
That's very unique. I think it's Woolly Goat or Wool Goat.
Okay,
it might be Woolly Goat. This dude on Instagram I follow, his shit is, it's bananas.
Yeah,
but it's also really really graphic sometimes. Like he has a scene of Gumby with a big huge dick. Which I can't tell what he's fucking with it, but it's fucking gross. But he does a lot of like Simpsons things, but he just transforms it in a way that like that's his style. I mean, they're like heavy metal, you know, that kind of old shit has it references that in a way, but it you have to see his work.
Anyway, to get back to your topic, it's neat to see a filmmaker do that.
Yeah.
Right, it just kind of seems like that's what you're trying to articulate.
And it's not just good for the fact that he did it.
Mm-hmm.
Is that in my mind he did it and he did it so goddamn well.
Right.
You know, and it wasn't just like a shift of like, oh, that's how we, you know, Kurosawa changed it over time. You know, everyone, well, George Lucas changed over time because I think he still sucks. But
you know who I was thinking about was
like, people gradually get better, right. and they change. But this one, it was like, no, he, like you said, I'm going to try this. And
right.
he just did a whole movie, and then he went back to making another movie completely different again.
Right.
You know, that took balls, and I think he did an amazing job.
I think you look at somebody like Bong Joon-ho. Look at Memories of Murder, look at The Host, look at Snowpiercer.
Yeah.
I think those are all very different movies.
Yeah.
I think he goes out of his way to like try to do something else or like try to have a different tone or make a different kind of a movie.
Park Chan-wook, I mean.
His movies.
But when he did when he did Thirst and then he did that fucking weird one that was like a kid's movie.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, but those still to me, well, I don't remember the kids. I am a cyborg and that's okay.
Yeah.
They're going, you know, a deep cut, motherfucker, there's a deep cut.
We do some Korean film here, man.
No, I still think his movies though, like ultimately feel pretty similar. Like they feel like Park Chan-wook movies.
Yes.
I can't say one way or the other because I already knew all those movies were Bong Joon-ho movies, but like, I feel like you'd have a less, I feel like if you watch Snowpiercer,
well, one
and
also
you watch
has
Memories
like,
of Murder.
One's also in English with like some American actors. So
okay,
it's,
well,
it
fair
is.
Enough. If you saw The Host and you saw Memories of Murder, I don't know that you would just say like, oh, those are obviously by the same filmmaker. But maybe you would.
If I watch any Korean like procedural or like really they're crime drama, the same guy made all these movies, right?
That's why I just watched a movie called The Wailing by the same guy who did The Chaser. I don't remember his name. And I really, really want you to watch it because I want to talk to you about it.
Yeah. If it's the guy who made The Chaser, then I would like to watch it.
It's very evocative of memories of murder. It's a small village and there's murders happening in it. They took like six, like long time, like I want to say like 5 or 6 years to shoot it. Like something crazy. I don't know where I read that. The cinematography is incredible, and it looks a lot like Memories of Murder.
I watched the trailer for The Train to Busan.
Yeah,
that what it's called?
That
Busan?
Played before what The Wailing.
I watched it without the volume on. I didn't have the speakers on at that time. Yeah. Like whatever. I mean, yeah, it looks interesting, but I don't know that.
Let me put it this way. I watched the trailer and I didn't go, holy shit, I got to watch that. I just went like, okay, Korea made a zombie movie. But then I
was like, oh, it's World War Z in Korea? Is that?
I heard some people say that it's like the best zombie movie since Shaun of the Dead and stuff like
Which,
that.
Which,
so.
It's weird that you mentioned that because Shaun of the Dead's a comedy. And the reason why Shaun of the Dead was so good was it was a good zombie movie.
Right.
But it was fucking funny.
Yeah.
You know, it was well made.
I mean, that just might mean like uniqueness and, you know, all that kind of stuff.
I just saw the shambling, like, flow of water of zombies.
Right.
And I went, it's World War Z in Korea. Right. But I mean, it looked interesting.
My hope for that movie, if I ever end up watching it, is that they do really unique things with the idea that it's trains. So if it's a movie that's constantly, like, innovating, like, okay, like I said, your set here? Okay, your set here is you have trains. So what do you do with that? I don't know. I don't know enough about trains. You tell me, you show me, you know?
I'm looking at this all wrong. I'm looking at the director stuff and
yeah. So, did you want to say anything else about Soderbergh? What is this video? Oh,
sorry, you were talking about Bong Joon-ho and stuff like that, and I was gonna say another good example of someone is I don't know how to say his name. It's Ji-Woon Kim.
Okay.
He did. So you've seen all these movies actually. You just don't know. So we watched Tale of Two Sisters,
uh-huh.
which was a remake of the Japanese one or whatever. I saw The Devil.
Okay. Yeah, I knew that.
I like it.
Right. Yeah.
Bittersweet Life.
Right.
And then The Good, Bad, and the Weird.
That's another great example.
I
fucking love Korean movies. Just because within their own movies, I've never seen movies from any other place, including here in the United States, where so many of them do not care about having a consistent tone. And I don't mean in like a shitty way, like, you know, like it sucks. I mean like they're good at it.
Yes.
They're fucking good
at it.
That's
why I was going, I know The Good, Bad, and the Weird, the guy made other movies that I love. I Saw the Devil. That's like one of my favorite. Yeah. That's a fucking great revenge movie.
Yeah, agreed.
I mean, just
it's
plot is like there's a bad guy and there's a cop who kind of goes rogue.
Movie.
Yes. He basically tortures the bad guy by repeat, like, hey, you raped and killed a bunch of women. Well, so rather than locking you up, I'm just going to make your life a living fucking hell for the next, like, I'm going to hunt you down. I'm going to beat the shit out of you. And then I'm going to go away and I'm going to let you heal.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to hunt you down again when you're not expecting me and I'm going to beat the shit out of you again.
Koreans, man. They make the best revenge movies.
That's a great fucking movie. But then at the same time, then he makes a fucking, can I say Western?
Yeah, it's a Western.
It's a Western, but it's so The Good and Bad and the Weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, weird is an understatement. That movie is phenomenal, though.
Shout out to Bittersweet Life, man. That's a movie I'm sitting here waiting for a Blu-ray on. That was a great fucking movie. It has one of the best action sequences I've ever seen in a movie. So I don't know if you even remember it or saw it.
I remember at one point you gave me a burned DVD. This was like years ago.
No,
I watched it.
Fucking good.
I don't remember much.
It's a part where they're gonna like he's like in the mafia or the organized crime or whatever, and he knows he's gonna die, and they're like digging his hole for him or whatever, and well, now I'm going to spoil the shit out of the movie. The whole, from that point on, like, because it's like the tone of it is all dark, and he's going to get put in this grave or whatever, and he decides, like, no, I'm gonna fight back. And he's got a cell phone. He ends up taking the battery out of it, and there's, like, a little metal battery piece, and
right.
He just starts, that's the beginning of it. He uses that as, like, a weapon. And then it gets to the point where he ends up taking out, like, all these guys. It's an amazing action sequence, and then it turns into this big revenge thing where he takes it all the way to the top and, you know, to the mob boss and everything like that. And then you get to the end, you kind of realize, like, oh, no, probably that was all in his head.
But that was, I just remember a lot of legs doing roundhouse kicks
and then
a car doing a donut at one point hitting guys.
Yeah, he's like fucking people up with a car.
But that's Byung Hong Lee, right?
I thought so. That's what you just
said.
Like
the Korea's biggest actor.
Oh, the actor.
Right?
Yeah. The guy from the video games.
He's the one that's in I Saw the Devil,
right.
And he's one in Terminator Genesis.
Yeah, I know.
And G.I. Joe.
Right.
So, yeah, he's that was one of his early.
Yeah.
Before he was really, really, really big. Yeah, that's a good movie. I don't remember much about it.
I got Memories of Murder on Blu-ray. Not on Blu-ray. It doesn't exist on DVD, by the way.
Hey, man, Korean movies are great. That's all you want to know.
Yeah. And they're still making good ones. I haven't seen Handmaiden yet. It's not in theaters anymore, so I'll have to wait until it comes out on video.
Yeah. If you want to watch, hey, we should do a Korean movie thing.
I mean, just like, here they all are.
Yeah, I mean, we've been talking about doing like
this is A Man from Nowhere, probably best knife fight scene in a movie ever. City of Violence, I didn't like it as much as you did.
Oh,
but
you're a jerk. I watched Crying
Fist. Crying Fist, I was going to mention.
Well, I think we're going to do like, because we've been talking about like, want to do like Kung Fu podcasts and stuff like that, and you know, Asian movies in general, but we just don't really know. There's so much we're not sure how we do, but like, it can't just be Kung Fu movies because we also like the crime dramas and shit. Yeah. But yeah, like, I watched Crying Fist the other night, which is the second best boxing movie ever made.
Yeah,
I think it challenges Rocky
especially
in the actual boxing. Like, having, I mean, Choi Min-sik used to be a boxer,
right?
So having an actual like boxing match where the guys were going at it, like, that was really good. But that movie is just like beautiful, and
yeah,
I just cry at the end because he's crying and it's just so good. Shit like that, like, I don't even know how we would sit down and go like, hey, let's all do this guy's movies, you know?
Because
he's the same one who did City of Violence.
Maybe just like compose a list. Just be like, of all the ones I've seen, like, these are the
ones. But like, should we do
watch
them by director, or should we?
You know
do
what
them, you
I've
know?
Always wanted to do is actually, there's always like 5 or 6 good Korean movies streaming on Netflix.
Yeah, I don't. There's always good. I mean,
not really. I mean, but like specifically Korean, because I don't go like, I'm never on Netflix and I see like, oh, Once Upon a Time in China. Like, there's never, it's specifically, for whatever reason, there's the same like 5 or 6 Korean movies. Like, I Saw the Devil has been on Netflix forever. I don't know if that's like a deal with that or whatever, but like, you could go on and just watch that right now.
They got, I think it's, well, no, that's a Hong
Man,
Kong.
The Man from Nowhere was on there for because
they're good movies. That's why they get, that's
the Good,
because
the Weird, I think, was on there too.
Because of Snowpiercer as well.
Yeah,
they
and
do
Snow
get
Piercer,
some
right.
American, right. You know, they get into the market a little bit. You're gonna tell me something?
I was just saying, since we're winding down,
that's gonna
Korean
be a weird
movies.
Cut where it just like stopped all of a sudden. I had to blow my nose.
So Bong Joon-ho is working on another monster movie. So that's very exciting. It's an American movie,
right?
With Jake Gyllenhaal and other people. But I'm excited for that, whatever that ends up being. And so Park Chan-wook, I haven't seen Handmaiden yet, but he is from, I think, and I could get this wrong.
Probably wrong.
I'm pretty sure.
But we're experts.
I think that he's working on a script by. Now I'm gonna forget his fucking name. The dude that I
the guy who wrote like Hellraiser 3?
Bone Tomahawk.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's doing. I think he's doing a western.
For if I wasn't talking over you, that's Bone Tomahawk.
Yeah,
not Hellraiser 3.
I'm having a really hard time remembering the filmmaker writer's name.
Oh, I never knew what it was.
But
I can look it up because we should plug him because he's really good, awesome.
And I don't think I'm mixing this up with another thing that I complained about before or talked about before. He was originally supposed to be one of the guys working. He was supposed to do The Revenant.
S. Craig Zahler.
Zahler, right. Or Zahler or Zahler.
So he directs and writes.
Yeah.
So
can you just actually look at Park Chan-wook now so I can make sure that I'm not...
God.
Okay, fine. Well, I'll talk while you do that. So Park Chan-wook was actually also supposed to be one of the original filmmakers that was supposed to do The Revenant, and then that fell out. And then it was supposed to be John Hillcoat, who did The Road. And The Proposition before What's-His-Fuckface took over the movie.
It doesn't show anything past The Handmaiden.
Okay.
So
maybe I made it up. I might have made it up.
Whatever.
I hope not. I like just made that up. You know, I used to have this thing when I was
a kid. Hey, we just will it into existence, it'll happen.
When I was a kid, I would have dreams that it was like my birthday, and I would have presents and I got presents in my dreams that don't exist, and then I wake up and it'd be a double thing. It'd be like, one, it's not your birthday, motherfucker, and two, even when it is your birthday, even when it's your birthday for the rest of your life, these things that you got in your dream, you're never gonna get.
That's
things.
So weird. We were talking about that the other day at work. We're just saying like, have you ever those dreams where like something happens and then you wake up and you're like, oh, like, just I had a better job, or you know, like, not even like, oh, I won the lottery and I bought a Lamborghini. It was like, oh no, this really awesome thing happened, like, you dug up a pound of gold in the backyard, you know, just something that was like a nice little break.
Yeah.
Or I had a hoverboard. Those don't fucking exist.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I always had dreams where I'm like basically Jackie Chan, where I'm like jumping, flipping. I had a dream the day I was fucking the Falcon guy.
That's my.
And I was yelling at Chris Evans, the Captain America, going, you should know better, this and that. And then I woke up like, oh, that was fucking fun. I was flying and shit, you know.
I'll never be able to yell at Captain America. yeah, that's what I do. I have dreams that Park Chan-wook directs westerns written by Craig Zahler. And then I wake up and find out that's not true.
Okay.
What else do you want to talk about?
Let's get off the Korean movies are good.
Yeah.
That's next. You know, whatever. Good, Bad, and the Weird. It's a really good movie.
Yep.
Also, a really good little twist at the end.
Do you want to talk about Don't Breathe?
I was going
to
say, yeah, we were going to talk about Don't Breathe, so we just got really sidetracked for a while there. So we watched Don't Breathe because, you know, I like horror movies. You like horror movies.
What's the name of this guy?
No idea.
Oh, okay. Well, it's the same guy who remade.
God damn it, I got to look everything.
It's
I had
the
to,
same
like,
guy that remade Evil Dead.
Which I fucking loved that Evil Dead remake.
I fucking love, but I thought it was a slick looking movie. I think it's well made. You know, I just thought that it wasn't very. I know it wasn't trying to be funny, but like to me, Evil Dead is supposed to be funny. Wasn't made no attempt to be funny at all.
I thought it hit a really good like, not remaking it in the sense that like let's try to recapture Bruce Campbell's like that stuff. They did a good. They had the tone right of what Evil Dead should be.
I'd kind
of like when you watch like Cabin in the Woods. Being Cabin in the Woods. It was great, you know?
Yeah.
I thought Evil Dead did a good job of finding the good tone like that as well.
I guess. I don't think it had a tone really, like Evil Dead at all.
Really creepy and kind of horrific, but also really ridiculous.
Ever I don't think it ever... I guess so. I just never thought it was, like, funny or anything.
The goddamn blood rain at the end. I thought... They went so over the top with it.
Yeah,
it
but
it,
the movie felt like it was... The movie felt like it was trying to tell you that that was serious. I don't think that ever... Mm. I don't think the movie thinks that that's goofy. And that's what I'm going to talk about a little bit in Don't Breathe. If the movie...
Okay, his name is Fede Alvarez.
Okay, I knew...
I don't know if he said his first name.
I think if the movie if the movie actually thought it was silly and embraced its silliness some, I would be okay. But I don't think it's true. I think it's saying, look, I'm super serious. And it's with its... I know we haven't even talked about Don't Breathe yet,
okay,
but I want to talk about this because it's going to frame what I'm going to say about Don't Breathe.
I don't think it is silly at any point.
I agree, but I think Evil Dead is inherently silly. I think yes. Evil Dead is like that's part of it. So but the remake didn't have any of that.
So what are you saying about Don't Breathe?
I haven't talked about Don't Breathe yet, but here's my point. The Evil Dead remake wanted to be taken more seriously as a movie. That's what I felt like when I was watching it. But I'm like, I'm not going to take you seriously.
No, not at all.
I think so.
Okay, I think it's one of those. I can't think of another example right now because we're on the spot. But the idea that I said. It's a good mix of Return of the Living Dead.
No.
It is a comedy, but it's also horrific and horror.
What's a funny part in the Evil Dead remake?
When she gets shot with the nails. It's like one of the things I remember.
Or is it literally trying to shock you? Those are two different things.
It's a shockingly funny. The guy, the hippie kind of guy. Like I think. It's been a while since I watched it, but. The fact it's raining, you're right, because you could try to take it serious. But
I thought that was supposed to be like dramatic.
I thought it was fucking. I was laughing.
Right, it is because it's stupid.
It's like Nightmare on Elm Street when he pulls the guy into the fucking bed and then literally a waterfall of blood comes out. It's just stupid, right?
I
can't. That's not serious. They're not trying to be serious.
No. Well, when we watch Don't Breathe, and that there's a thing that happens, I go, this is fucking stupid. There's no way that this is serious. Now, if you're going to try to convince me
that they're... the turkey baster?
Yes, abso-fucking-lutely. Now, if you want to get to that and you want to tell me that they are knowingly doing that and winking at me, and it's
yes,
like...
Yes, come on.
I don't think that's true. I think that they think that this is why... Listen, this is... Because we've talked about this before. I told you we were going to argue about this.
I want to put this up front.
You've heard me talk about this before. I don't like movies, but like horror movies.
Movies? Get out of here.
I don't like horror movies that go like this. Isn't this fucked up? Dude, bro, check out how fucked up this thing is can you believe how fucked up this thing is that I fucked up for you? I don't like that, and I'm not into it, and I go...
Well, give me an example. What movie? Like, what movie are you talking about? Like, can you give me...
I'm talking about Don't Breathe.
But no, that's so fucked up. Like, you mean like Hostel?
Torture porn. Like, the whole torture porn thing that kicked me out of horror movies for years.
Right, like, so you're like, it's like a Hostel thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, no, not Hostel, because Hostel's funny. Because
Eli Roth still has
Hostel is absolutely self-aware and joking.
Part two is like very...
No, part two is even more like that.
Yeah, you're right.
It's been a long time since I watched these movies. I'd be willing to watch them to affirm a theory that I have that people... unfairly malign him like for that kind of stuff. I think those movies are actually very feminist, which is crazy. Like, I think the first movie, like, it'd be very easy to have your character, like, you would want to, again,
the idea that
in
you're
the shitty
the guys.
Torture porn movies, it'd be girls that are getting tortured and all right. That kind of stuff. This time it's fucking dudes, right? So there can be no sexual thing about it unless you're gay or whatever. In the second one, it's a girl, but in that movie, the whole point is she becomes one of the fucking, like, and cuts a dude's balls off and feeds him to a dog and a whole thing, where she becomes, like, king bitch. Like, it's been a long time since I've seen those movies, but,
there's
like...
that scene in the first one when he's, like, pleading with the guy, and the guy's, like, basically cumming his pants.
Yeah, that's true.
So
absolutely.
It is sexual.
I think that Eli Roth is aware of that stuff. So when it's funny when I say I don't like torture porn, and then somebody says, like, oh, so you don't like Hostel, and I go, let me back up a little bit. I don't think
that was like that was like a premiere of it, but then it's like everyone like wanted to get on that.
But I also think that they were doing it wrong. So like,
yeah.
I know I don't like any of the Texas Chainsaw remakes, okay? And I don't like the Saw movies. I don't like anything where I'm watching it and it's like this serious fucked up shit.
Saw
look
is,
how fucked up and serious this
I'm gonna
is.
Say Saw is probably a really good example of what you're saying.
I haven't seen Human Centipede. I assume probably like something like Human Centipede, like I don't want to watch, you know.
I'm gonna say a little shout out to Chad A. Armstrong. He's the CEO or runs the Crypt, the like a horror app, I think. He works with Eli Roth. He's my old boss from like way back in the day when we used to work at GameStop.
All right, shout out.
What's up, Chad?
So anyway, there? That so when you asked for examples, those are my examples. So in
he runs legless corpse films. Yeah.
In Evil Dead, I feel like that's kind of what it's doing.
Oops.
Also, completely squandering a good concept, a good idea, which is she possessed by a demon or is she dealing with her withdrawal from drugs? I'm talking about the first Evil Dead remake.
I don't remember anything about that movie.
Right, because it wasn't good. They didn't.
No,
do,
I just
because it was a cool concept. They didn't do anything with.
I think I watched it in the middle of the night while working at security.
Evil Dead 2 or Evil Dead remake is about teenage or whatever young adults that go up to a cabin because one of their friends is addicted to drugs and they want to.
Is it sad that I don't remember any of this?
Because it's a good. I remember watching it and giving it goodwill. I'm like, this is actually an interesting. This is interesting. Let's see where this goes. It's abandoned like immediately. Like it's like, oh no, she's obviously a fucking demon. Like it's not. No, you can't. I don't care how addicted to drugs you are, how much withdrawal you're going, you can't like float up in the air. Like, you know, but it would have been such a neat thing if it actually was that. If it was like a whole thing, you know, that would be, it wouldn't be, I still wouldn't be Evil Dead to me because that's so fucking serious and not silly.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of, well, we'll get to that in the emails, but you haven't watched any more Ash vs. Evil Dead, huh?
No.
Let's get off of this. Let's get back to Don't Breathe.
Okay, so back to Don't Breathe. So,
okay, so it.
I won't review it first.
Not,
go ahead.
This is not some phenomenal,
it's not.
Amazing movie. It's just.
I'm not holding it to that standard.
The basic premise for when it came out and the way it was taken, as far as I thought, was for a low budget.
Made kinda, a lot of money, too.
You know, this is better than all the fucking, how many, not the Poltergeist, but the fucking, the
yes.
The found footage ones in the house. What are the, what's it called?
Paranormal
Activities.
Activity. I like
just like the ones that have the Conjuring, I mean, not that those are bad movies, but just that they're spawning like infinite sequels to this shit, right? You have an original-ish, you know, low
People
budget
horror. Stairs.
This is better. I like People Under the Stairs.
No, I'm
a
saying
lot.
It's not original.
But what I mean, it's not another sequel to something that's already out right now. And it does a good job of not being just a slapdash, stupid, like you were talking about, hey, fucked up. You think it is.
No, not. It's literally, you could cut like 10 or 15 minutes out of this movie, and I would have like no problem. I'd be like, no, that was good. It was well made. Like, you know, the characters suck, but you know,
yeah.
But like that was good. Like those good set pieces. Like I thought everything was really
the premise
really
is really
great.
Good.
The premise is cool. I was into it. I just those 10 or 15, and they literally it felt like they were writing the script and they went, shit, the movie's gonna be too short.
I can see what you mean.
And then
yeah,
they had like we need something A. To pad this out to whatever.
Because if it had just been a straight, from beginning to end, suspenseful the whole time, you could have done a really...
Also, you kind of feel bad for the guy.
Yeah.
Like, initially, you're just like, fuck these teenagers, this is... Fuck them.
Yeah.
Like, I thought it was going to be this movie about how, like they gleefully all get taken out by, like, this dude. But you're like, I don't know. And then, like, they had to do something that, like, in stark relief made him, like, an absolute monster. But it would have been... I know this isn't the movie it's trying to be, but this is why I brought up the Evil Dead remake stuff.
Yeah.
It was an interesting... premise. What about another version of this movie where both sides
are bad,
oh, but also good?
Right.
Like, you know, like you feel bad for the poor kid, the poor girl who's just trying to get her sister out of that situation.
Yeah.
And it's funny because I was reading some stuff online and people were obviously we're just talking about the fucking movie now. They were like, oh, but she was being selfish and all this stuff. She kept going for the money. I'm like, I never read it that way. I read it as like she's still just thinking about her sister. It's like a big deal for her to just be, you know, to get.
But also, if it's like you've already gone this far, you might as well get what you came for.
Right. I've seen movies like that where it's like you've gone this far to get the money. But I bought into the goodwill of the movie saying like it's an abusive household and she's trying to get her sister out of it. Like that didn't bother me. And she's too young to know that she could just fucking get a job and move down the street. Where the fuck? They have to move to California with $1 million. Whatever. Yeah. But then also, there's this old guy whose daughter died. He just wants to be left alone, and these teenagers are breaking into his house. Again, it didn't have to be that movie.
There's a reason why he wants to be left alone, but yeah.
It didn't have to be that movie,
right?
Like it could have just been that, right? And it would have been interesting.
That's what I'm saying. That could have been a suspenseful from beginning to end.
The lengths that both of them go at that point. Imagine I don't even need to have a motive like that crazy motive. It could have just been like him breaking down. Like, I've gone through this much shit, and people are trying to, you know, what if it was a thing where they stole the money, but they also took something that was like belonged to his daughter, you know, or like it was something that just like sentimentally, like he just can't handle like somebody taking that, and he's just like the whole stuff with him, like God, when God exists, you can do anything. You could have stuck with that, like a man broken, just like fuck these kids. I am gonna fuck these kids because a teenager took a young person took my daughter's life. Fuck these kids. Fuck them for thinking they can take whatever they want. He could have still done all of that, and it would have been so much more compelling because I would have felt bad for him and bad for the kids, and I wouldn't have known. And they could have had a struggle at the end, and it would have, you know. But that's not what this movie is, right?
Right.
Just like the Evil Dead remake.
And
it was like, but fuck all that shit.
And I'm glad I think you get it, that it's not that it's bad on its own or because of this. It's because it didn't gel with what you wanted it to be.
Right, but
it chose a different direction.
But I didn't need it. But again, if you had taken out that thing that I take umbrage with, like I probably wouldn't have thought any of these things. I would have just said like, you know, it's a good movie.
Yeah.
I still think that. I reacted really strongly to it while I was watching it.
Yeah, you did.
And then when I got to the end, because there was a couple of really good scenes still at the end, and I said like, okay, it's, you know, it's fine.
Yeah.
It's fine. Okay, I said my piece. You can talk about Don't Breathe now.
Okay, so just a really quick, it's three kids. This is supposed to be Detroit, or a suburb of Detroit. It's a neighborhood. It's completely fallen apart, and he's the old guy who's blind because he lost his sight in the war. So he's a veteran. His daughter was killed in a car crash years ago by another teenage girl who came from a rich family, and they basically bought his silence so she didn't go to jail. So he's a, you know, bitter old man living by himself. He has the only house in an entirely abandoned neighborhood for like five blocks.
Like Fight Club house.
Yeah. And
hit golf balls and nobody would care.
And these three teenagers realize one of the guy's dads works for a security company, so they get keys to the houses because they're like, you know, they're emergency response, so he can like, oh, you have a spare key to the house. So they break into houses and steal shit. Not to get too many specifics. They would decide, oh, he's got a bunch of money in there. We read about him. We're going to break into his house. Of course, what happens is they break in, and he's a fucking badass because he's blind.
His Zatoichi powers because he was in the Marines.
Well, he can, you know, he's learned to live as a blind person, so he knows his way around
the
house.
But they gave him superpowers.
Like what, though?
They turned on an alarm, and that was like his demise. That's not a thing.
That was kind of,
deaf people fucking, oh my God, kryptonites. I mean, I blind people, excuse me.
It was a loud thing. He couldn't rely on his sense of hearing. I know what you mean, but whatever.
He's acting like he's Batman, like Man-Bat. Like.
Yeah. Regardless, so they get more than they bargained for, and he's got bars in the windows, right. And it very as much the people under the stairs. You got in, whoa, this is more than we bargained for. We didn't realize it was this much shit in here. You know, he does not, he fucking kills the first one, no problem. He doesn't decide to call the cops on him. After he wrestles the gun out of his hand, out of the kid's hand, and the kid, I mean, is that actor, he's, I don't know who, he's in...
Who? What?
The guy, the cornrows.
I don't know. I feel like he's
in other movies.
One of them was in It Follows. Or maybe the girl was.
No,
I can't remember.
No.
Somebody said one of them was in It Follows.
It feels like It Follows. No, It Follows, phenomenal fucking horror movie. You should go see that as well. This one feels a lot like It Follows. And the idea just...
I mean, I'm not going to put them anywhere close
location,
to each other.
Location, coloring, like, just the, you know...
Well, they were both shot... They're also both take place in Detroit.
Right. And same... Well, not time period, but it... They feel very similar in tone sometimes. Not the horror. Well, yeah, you know what? I don't know. Whatever. Fuck it. It Follows is good. So when he wrestles the gun out of the first kid's hand and he's choking him out and the guy's like, please let me go. I'm sorry. I broke into your house. He's just like, fuck you. And he just shoots him right in the neck.
Yeah.
At this point, you go, okay, dude's a badass.
Right.
Dude doesn't give a shit.
And also bad.
And when because when he does it, he's more like, God damn it, I got to fucking clean up this dead body.
Right.
Not like I'm going to call the cops and say, hey, someone broke into my house.
Right.
So that's your first inkling that like, maybe he's not as good as, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I already knew, you could just tell from the way the movie was being presented to you, that so it's given to you as a suspense thriller. Mm-hmm. A Panic Room style movie.
You mentioned Panic Room. He's cribbing David Fincher with the camera, like moving across or underneath the bottom of the bed to show you the gun, and then it moves across here and shows you the bell on the door and all this kind of stuff.
So had it been straight Panic Room, I think that's what you're saying, is that if it had been 10 minutes shorter and it had just gone the Panic Room route, it could have been a really good suspense thriller. But this movie is actually a hidden horror movie.
Okay, but it's a bad horror movie.
That's fine. That's your opinion. And your opinion means nothing to me.
It's a bad horror movie.
Because you find out later on is that as they go into the basement, which is locked up pretty good, it makes you kind of go, I don't think his treasure's in the basement. I think that locks there to keep something from coming out of the basement. He has kidnapped the girl who killed his daughter and has her all fucking tied up downstairs as punishment. and then the thing happens that you don't like.
It's just it's
which I think is
fucking the scissors and the I'm gonna cut a little hole in your pants and the turkey baster.
I go. I think this is meant to be ridiculous enough that it's kind of funny.
I think that it's ridiculous because these guys are stupid and they think that that's fucked up shit.
Could be. You know, if they think they're actually trying to put like push the viewer into like, wow, this is dramatic, and I'm watching it going like, oh my god, this is so bad, this is awesome.
I mean, there's a possibility you're right. She shoves the fucking turkey baster down his throat like afterwards and stuff. So like,
So he's kidnapped that girl and he's. But that's where you look like, who's the bad guy, who's the good guy? They're a little bit of both.
He's the fucking bad guy.
He's the bad guy. But then he even says like, okay, so he's kidnapped this girl. He's got her tied up. He's made her pregnant with his sperm. But then he goes at one point. He goes on a big tirade speech. He goes, I'm not a rapist. I didn't have sex with her. I used this turkey baster to put my sperm in
which
her.
Which to me, actually, if I'm going to give the movie any credit, seems like a very pointed line about like, I'm not a rapist. I just had sex with her while she was passed out.
I don't know.
Hang on. Let me ask you something. Is turkey basting somebody and making them pregnant while they're tied up?
See, but
is that not rape?
Okay, what they're trying to do is they're trying to take this villainous villain, but like he's only like that because he's broken. Like you said, like he reached a point of no return. He got broken because he lost everything that meant to him. So he's not actually like a fucking demonic bad guy. It's that he has last resort.
But I'm saying just at a movie making level, it should have been one or the other.
They
ended up in some weird fucking weird ass middle ground.
I will concede that. Well, yes.
Because he could have just been a monster, like a scary Jason Voorhees,
right,
which he kind of was, but like just from beginning to end, and that's what he was. And you never humanized him at all, and that would have been one thing.
I could go with you.
There would have been your horror movie.
I don't care. Because
it would have been People Under the Stairs, because People Under the Stairs is, what is the horror? We broke into a house, and we didn't know we broke into a monster's house.
Right.
That's what that movie is. Like, oh shit, you accidentally, you've done fucked up. You didn't know that this house was ran by monsters.
Yeah.
And now it's a movie about surviving monsters. That's not what this was.
I don't disagree with you, but I let people make the movies that they want to make.
It's fine. It's just,
you know,
it's like what you said. It's like what could have been kind of stuff. It's like, God, if you just fucking like.
Gone one way or the other. Yes, I agree. But again, I can take it at face value for what it is.
Right.
Yes, he tries to say that he's not a monster. He's just a broken ass man.
Yeah.
He's going to have this girl inseminated to give him another daughter again for what she took away from him. And he's going to let her go. He's not going to kill her. He's not going to torture her. He just wants her to be punished for the crime that, you know, her rich family, they got off because they had money. He wants her to know true punishment. It's hard to argue with that in a way. But obviously what he's doing is bad. I know.
It's fucking stupid.
So, yes, the turkey baster thing. And then
he just has like a vat of his own semen and the fucking thing. Just because that's, you know, I thought that's what your testicles do, but, you know, I could be wrong.
There's some really good shit because, like, you know, they're sneaking around the house trying to be quiet as possible. And
you know, that means that all that jerking off that he does in that vat to make all that
is rape.
No, I was going to say that, like, you know, he can't watch porn. So literally just whatever spank bank he has in his memories since the time he was blind, that's what he's been jerking off to the whole time.
Could we?
Oh, is that too fucked up? Is that too fucked up with
no,
a turkey basting?
Maybe the conversation between me and you. Let's not get it too.
What
is this podcast?
This movie had the balls to have turkey based rape, but not the balls to kill dog.
You're right. Only the most fucked up people.
But
kill
we're not
dogs.
Gonna. Let's not get crazy. We're not gonna kill dogs. We're not monsters. Anyway,
I was just saying, I don't know what this podcast.
I wish that this filmmaker would get it, like, would knock it off with like writing his own scripts or getting like the same person to write the scripts. I think he's a very talented filmmaker.
Yeah, because I gotta say, there's some really good shit where they go in the basement and he gets them trapped down there and he turns off all the lights.
Yeah, that was cool.
And so now they're operating on his level, but the problem is he's been operating that for a while. And it's great because you see him running through the basement and he has all these
things he's touching, and
like he's like, I'm putting my hand up because I'm expecting to hit a beam.
Yeah.
Once I hit that beam, I know how far I've gone. Make a left turn. You
right.
know, he has mapped this world out, and you see his physicality.
Right.
This is Stephen Lang, the fucking bad guy from Avatar.
Mm.
And they do such a good job of making, like you said, he's a monster, but he's not superpowers, but
he's
in a weird way, he's kind of superpowery because he's learned to adapt.
Yeah.
That shit's really cool. The fucking vent, the dog going in the vent, like that was stupid because like vents aren't that big. There's no air vent that has people.
Well, it was kind of more like a weird. I was expecting like how much of a People Under the Stairs thing is this going to be? Is there going to be like these fucking like
bodies
walls that you can run through and all this kind of stuff? I didn't mind that so much. I didn't understand why she had to fall head first down that fucking thing and then not break her neck.
I don't know.
But no, I don't know. I kind of like that stuff actually. I don't know what dog would fucking like jump up and crawl up a vent or whatever. But the stuff with the dog, like where, you know, he falls out the window and then lands on the thing, it's that Spielberg Lost World thing where the glass is cracking and all that.
Yeah.
Stuff. There's some good stuff. The whole thing with her, I'll tell you things I like, okay? it's movies, it's well shot and the set pieces are good. There's good action set pieces.
The lighting is really cool because it where it takes place, there's a lot of trees outside, a lot of buildings nearby. So when there is sunlight, it is very, it's not direct sunlight as it is. And his house is very dark because a lot of it feels enclosed, you know, rooms within that aren't exterior rooms, so they might not have a window, or the one window is like way in the back, and all the, you know, like the old ass, I can remember like an old ass kitchen with like a stained glass window kind of thing. The light coming in is very yellow.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of the house is very like bluish and brown.
Yeah.
It has a really cool look to it. It reminds me of when you go on vacation somewhere and you go somewhere that's not your own house.
Right.
And, well, you know, you can't do a hotel. But you have to, like, go maybe do, like, rent a house. Like, when I was a kid, I went to the cabin in the woods, something like that. And you get a totally different look for how much sun comes in a certain room and how the furniture is different and the walls are different. And you get a different color.
Mm-hmm.
There's a very unique, cool color tone to this guy's house, which is, again, director photography type stuff. It looks visually
looks
very
great.
Interesting.
Yeah, it does. People
like, you're not blind, and there's enough light, but it makes it kind of hard to see in his house. And he doesn't fucking care. I mean, he's blind, you know?
I remember reading somebody who was like, "And he's blind, what does he need lights for?" I'm like, you can't just because there aren't houses that get built for blind people, you know? Like, there's going to be electricity and light switches and shit. I liked that people have listened to us before. I know I really appreciate spatial geography, like, in understanding what's happening and where your things are going. I never didn't, like, understand where they were in the
except
house.
Except for that fucking basement. I don't know
that's
how
different,
big
that,
and weird that basement
was. But that
was
the point of it. The point of that was supposed to be disorienting.
Claustrophobic and scary.
Right. I didn't have a problem with that. But, like, it's like, oh, now they're in the basement. Oh, now they're in the fucking torture room. Okay,
but there was,
this
like, multiple doors, and then it was a big open with shelves and hallways, and, yeah, but upstairs.
Yeah, I mean,
fine.
The actual house, I didn't have a problem with it. And they used it. It wasn't like they went in the kitchen and then never went in the kitchen again. Like, it was like, okay, they're in the kitchen again, and here, you know, now they're in the living room again, and now here they're going up the stairs again, and here we're in the bedroom again. Like, it was, they used that stuff really well. It kind of felt like The Raid sometimes, in some ways. I like that once we finally got to daylight.
Which I assume that means they were there overnight.
Right.
And this is the next morning.
Well, they said 2 o'clock in the morning, so it would have been like, I mean, if the sun rises at like 6 or something like that, then it would have been like 4 or 5 hours. That sounds about right.
Because they went in, they didn't, was it
they
dark?
They said 2. Well, they literally said 2 o'clock.
Yeah, he would be asleep. Like, you're right. They went in the middle of the night.
Well, no, they say out loud, it's 2 o'clock. Of course he's asleep.
Yes, I know. That's what I'm saying. Okay. So, yeah, I was remembering them.
By the way, is a chloroform plastic bottle thing a thing? I've never seen that
obviously
before.
Obviously not, because it didn't fucking work
on
him.
It didn't fucking work, because he's got superpowers. So I really like it when she got outside, and it was kind of like, oh, I'm outside now. This is what I'm talking about. That's like a fun, silly, like, that's the kind of scene, like, in Hostel. Like, that's a scene that's like, oh, fuck you, what are you going to fucking do now? It's daylight, and I'm outside, and you're blind, fucker. Like, that thing, and then,
yeah.
Oh, yeah, and here's the dog.
Yeah.
Like, that was a good, that was a fun scene that didn't seem like the kind of scene that should have been, like, in a rape movie. But, like, okay, like, so here comes the dog, and everything, that whole scene with her in the car, and, like, just... all the fucking, like, mechanics of, like, what she decided to do with the leash and the seat and everything like that was all really neat. God, I was so scared to death that, like, then once he got her again, I'm like, is this going to be one of those fucking movies where they all die?
Yeah.
This is going to be, like,
it
Wolf
was
Creek,
like that little
thing.
Suspense, the little skip of your heart goes, was, like, oh, man, she was going to get away, and then, like, nope, he fucking wins. But no.
I'm glad that she still, like, gets away or whatever. It's kind of a bummer.
What does she do? I don't remember how she gets away.
She turns on the alarm.
Oh, yeah, she hits the button,
and
the alarm's really loud.
Hits him with a crowbar.
So he covers his ears, and he's hurting in pain, yeah. And knocks him out. And then
he falls down his hole and shoots himself.
By accident, because he drops his gun, and it kind of, like, yeah. So what I like about this, though, is that at the end, when she's taking her little sister and they're going to California, they're like at the bus stop and she's watching the news and, you know, the home was broken into and he killed the intruders. He's not dead.
Which is what you're saying. My first thought is like, give me a fucking, what, he's going to, how?
He like shot himself with a magnet.
He's going to have to like train his dog to like track people down across the country or something. Well, I don't
know
what the hell.
It was, I looked at it like, it's going to end in one of two ways. One, she's like, I have to go kill this guy first. I can't leave until he's dead.
Because he's going
to
go get
because
another
he's,
girl
he might
and
go,
put him in
yeah,
the
that was,
dungeon.
That was her thing. Was like, we have to do justice because we have to kill this guy because he might, or we have to get out of here and get the cops because he might kidnap somebody else. He's a monster, right? But then how she's like, I have to just walk away from it. But he's also like, come get me. He very much was like, I'm ready for it. You know?
I mean, she's trying to get away. I thought it was kind of more like sequel. You don't know. He's going to come and get you.
No.
Which, again, what I was going to say is it was like, how the fuck is he going to come get you? But I'm like, well, he somehow managed to kidnap that girl that ran over his daughter,
right,
and did all that. Like, I don't know how the fuck, but whatever. I ain't gonna pick on that stuff because you can pick. You could pick this movie apart if you wanted to on that level, but it's not that kind of a movie, so leave it alone. I will say, like, the main character, like the main guy, whatever, that, like,
the kid or the guy.
What was his motive? The kid that had a crush on the girl. Like, I didn't know what his deal is. Like, they just show you the picture of his dad. I'm just like, why? He seems like he's got a nice house and stuff. Like, I don't understand, like, what.
He was doing it for her.
He's just like, I got a crush on her. I'm just saying, Liz, when I talk about, like, main characters, just like, I don't give a fuck about you then. Like, you have no good, like.
Yeah.
She
Nobody in this movie is good.
Well, I thought that the girl did
she
just
has motivations
enough.
That aren't.
Just enough.
She doesn't have. But, I mean. Yes, she has why she's doing what she's doing. She has true motivation. Like, but earlier in the movie, when they're robbing other people, she don't seem like she's remorseful.
This is
at
another
all.
Movie. Like, again, it's a different movie, and like, don't criticize the movie for not
and
being the movie
the,
you want.
The douchey
but,
asshole, the movie,
right?
You know?
But I'm saying, take the fucking 15 minutes of Rape Dungeon out, and add a 15 minutes in the first act where you let me see them at school. Let me show, because then my thing is like, well, get good grades and get a job and get the fuck out of here. Like, show that like they like. They
it's not that easy. Do you understand? Like, there's no opportunity there.
But
know?
Show me that.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. Because all they did was just like 8 Mile in her fucking trailer for 5 minutes. And,
right.
And that was it. Like, show me that. And then it would actually, you'd give me something which is like, I care about these kids, like a little bit. And I wouldn't just be like, fuck them for like breaking into people's houses.
I think they do that really well because the kid is smart. Like, he's like, when they break into houses earlier, he's like, less than $10,000 worth of stolen shit, because anything more than that is grand larceny. Like, you could tell he's intelligent.
He's smart enough to make me say, why is he doing any of this
because
stuff?
Because there probably is no opportunities, and it's a fun
again,
thrill,
then,
and
then
he's making
show
money.
Me that. Don't right. make me assume and infer all of that. Show me that.
And
that's
he wants to be
all.
Fitting with the cool kid. I mean, I don't know, but he obviously doesn't like what he's doing. He feels regret.
That would even be, like, good. Like, show me that, like, they get their report cards, and I know they don't get report cards anymore. I know nobody gets it anymore or whatever.
Yeah, they do.
Oh, do they? Okay. Well, show me he's got like, his report card, and like he's hiding it or something. He doesn't want her or him or somebody like that to know. Like he actually gets good grades. Despite all that, he's fucking like he's doing this because
see, but
he's, like,
not,
he's in love with her or something.
Again, so I think the dichotomy of his like trying to say, hey, man, don't go too hard. Just take what we need and we get out. We just make some money. Like, I'm not trying to hurt these people. And then her, she's that mix between where she's like, oh, she's really buddy-buddy with him, but she's also dating this really fucking douchey asshole.
Yeah.
And then there's the douchey asshole. So you get to see, like, what you're saying is true. You could have all the stuff. But I think what they just easily did was saying, look how bad this guy is because he's an asshole. He likes to rob people. He's a wannabe gangster. He wants to be tough guy and cool. This guy over here, they don't really get along. You know what I mean? He's mm-hmm. like, why are you being a bitch? Why are you being a pussy? And he's just like, fuck, why are you such an ass?
Don't you agree that it's a, I mean, I don't know how old they are. They don't even say actually whether they're
17.
In school or anything like
I think
that.
He's probably like 19. They're both like 17, 16.
I mean, I don't know. It seemed like a weird, I didn't know if I bought it. I'm like, really? Like right. These three white kids and they like got involved in this and stuff. And this, I don't know. I wanted a little bit more, but it's not that big of a deal.
Yeah, but like I said, I think that stuff right there shows like what you're talking about where the idea like why are they doing this like well she's got this motivation this guy's an asshole he's a good kid but he's kind of mixed up in the crowd but he's not bad
yeah
but no one's actually good
I'm just saying like the whole point back to I didn't even touch on any of this stuff because I actually didn't think it was that bad but I'm like why are you doing this in Detroit like you could do this anywhere this could be like in Bakersfield and like this guy could have like his compound house like out in the middle of nowhere or whatever and I'm like just okay fine so you want to deal with like these poor kids that want to get out of their poor like Rust Belt city or whatever show me don't just assume that I know all that and
right
you know,
I get it. It's not a 10 out of 10 awesome
no,
cool
it's
indie horror movie
okay
but it's a respectable 7 or 8
yeah I would give it a,
it could
I,
have
I,
been
I would
a
give
9
it a 7
it
I
could have been
a
9 or 10 very easily is yeah. the thing is that it had a lot of potential
yeah.
didn't quite hit the mark but it's
still,
also still really good
still looking forward to this guy's next movie with the hope that it actually has a decent script.
Okay, we need to move on.
Can I? Nope. I've been talking about this one thing. A 10 out of 10 movie is the movie I watched directly right after Don't Breathe, and you really need to watch it so we can talk about another Alphacast, is Green Room.
Which is?
Green Room is, so one, we're going to plug on, again, however many people are listening to this, go watch our Horror Siege video that nobody watches ever. This is like one of the like most obvious, like I watched that, I'm like, here's a perfect sincere entry into like the horror siege genre.
What is it?
You don't know anything about it. It's the one with Patrick Stewart with the neo-Nazis and stuff like that. You haven't heard anything?
You talked to me on the phone about it. I have no idea. No.
Okay. It's this punk band and they're like in Washington, like Pacific Northwest, and they're not like Nazi punkers. I guess punkers, there's all kinds, right? There's some that are like fuck Nazis and some that are like
yeah,
Nazis.
And not,
right. And so they get like a friend of, they're desperate for cash and they're like siphoning gas out of cars and stuff. And a friend of a friend's like, oh, I'll set you up with a gig to make some money. And they go out to this essentially Nazi punk bar But they're like, whatever, we'll just play the songs and then we'll get out of there.
Yeah.
But then it doesn't end up that way. And it's called Green Room because the green room is the band room in the back. But it's also where the room they get stuck in for like a long time. So it's fucking violent and really good and a great little crime. Patrick Stewart plays a neo-Nazi leader.
Jean-Luc Picard.
Yes.
Okay.
And he's great. And it also has the kid from Star Trek that died, and I didn't care, but now I care because he's actually a good actor.
Anton Yidsel
or whatever. Yeah. Anyway, bummer.
That whole thing with the Jeep is I own a Grand Cherokee. My wife owns a Grand Cherokee.
So it really hits you.
It
hits you.
You didn't pay attention. You didn't put it in park.
Yeah.
And I could see why, but that was your fault.
He was thinking about how good his performance was in Green.
Because they made like a whole recall on that, and I'm like, no, it's just if you're not paying attention, you could easily leave it neutral and not know.
Yeah.
But you have to check. It's your fault. Okay, we'll move on to
questions.
A second, I watched Purge Election Year.
I haven't watched
Purge
yet.
I like the Purge movies. The second and third one are
I want to watch them.
Nothing like the first one. The first one's a very horror siege movie. Yeah. The second one and third one are very much like, let's just extrapolate to like a fun horror movie.
Yeah.
Good. I love Frank Grillo.
Yeah.
That guy needs more roles. He's awesome. It's also very like political. I mean, it's called Election Year.
I heard about I heard other guys talk about this stuff.
It's good.
I plan to watch them. I want to watch them.
Watch Money Monster. I don't know why.
Do you want to watch that?
It had some effect on me with George Clooney. I'm like, I just kind of watch it.
God, you want to talk about like liberal elite?
That is so like on the nose. It's like, yep, isn't it obvious how the rich people are bad?
Yeah.
Which, I mean, I don't disagree with, but it's just so like doesn't have no deep whatever. But it was interesting. He's basically Jim Cramer. And his show's great. He plays such a great fucking character. It's worth it for that. I watch X-Men Apocalypse.
Moving on.
That was not a good movie.
Nope.
I like Days of Future Past. I like First Class. This one is not a good movie.
Nope.
And my wife was like, but didn't this happen? And didn't this happen? And I'm like, I don't fucking know why, how.
Doesn't matter. It's bad.
I might do an Overlooked on this movie called Cell. This is actually going to tie.
The one with Jennifer Lopez?
What? I don't even know what you're talking about.
There's this movie.
With Jennifer Lopez. Yeah, Cell. Okay, got it.
Okay. It's really kind of interesting. It's like you can like get inside, you know, she needs to go inside the serial killer's mind psyche or whatever to like find out where a kid's at or whatever. Okay, never
nothing with Jennifer Lopez is interesting.
Yeah, that's weird. Yeah. Probably not.
Dude, don't. I'm not going to shit on Jenny from the block because she's from the block still.
Gotcha.
Hey, you see all that money she's got? She's still from the block.
What is?
You don't know that song?
No.
I'm still a Jenny from the block.
Is that a
J-Lo
song?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't look at all the money that I got.
I know the if you had my love, da 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 da, would you comfort me? That's a J-Lo song, right?
That almost sounds like something I might know what you're talking about, but you just did it bad.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'm like, I throw things at you that I expect you to understand, and
I don't know any fucking J-Lo song. Sorry.
It was a really popular song, and you heard it everywhere you went, and you couldn't like not hear it.
But I didn't go anywhere, you see. So I could not hear it everywhere I went.
I guess you're right. Anyway, Cell is a Stephen King book turned into a really low-budget, straight-to-DVD movie with John Cusack and Samuel L. Jackson.
Oh, this is the 1408. Is it 1408? I can't remember the name.
Yeah, 1408. Yes, but cool, they're gonna be in together, and it's gonna be, and then they just like drop the ball on budget. But some of you watching go, no, this is actually, I could tell, like they tried to make a decent movie. Somewhere along the lines, like they lost money. They probably were like doing okay, and then you know, I might do a video on that because I really liked the book, even though we're gonna get into Stephen King emails, but he always has like. I'll explain to my wife. I watched 11/22/63, which is that time travel. Mm-hmm. It's also another Stephen King book with James Franco. That there's a certain point in every Stephen King book where you have to go, okay, now everything up to this point, this is like 500 or 600 pages. We halfway through, you know, it's realistic and this could have happened and whatever. Now is when the aliens show up. You know, like here's when things go. Don't take anything real anymore. Yeah. Cell is very much that book. Like there's a point where you're just like, oh, it went from a really interesting, realistic premise to like, oh, there's guys floating in the air. Okay.
Yeah.
I think it's totally underrated. People fucking hate that movie. You go to Netflix, you read the reviews. It's just shit, one star. It's shit on, but I'm like, I want to watch it because I like the book. I watched it and was like, why does everyone hate this movie? I could see why it wasn't good enough and it's low budget.
Like on par with anything?
It's got really bad special effects. I mean, I get that, but for what it was trying to do,
okay, so like 1408, for example, like that was worth one watch, but I don't know if I need to watch it again. Is it like
that's a thriller? This is a zombie movie.
Okay.
Close enough to be like it's basically a zombie movie.
I know, but I'm saying like I would argue that Session 9 is not one of the greatest movies ever made when I did it Overlooked on it, but I'm like, no, it's a good movie.
But like, what's so? Look, I don't think anyone could watch Session 9 and be like, "That's not a good movie. I don't like it." You know, I mean, or maybe
you think somebody would feel that way about watching Cell. So you just overlook for a different reason. You're just like, let me, but consider this. This is kind of like you're going to make your case for it.
They were too like, you know, oh, I like, this movie didn't have a high enough budget and it's just not good. You know, right. But no, it looked
cheap kind of thing.
At that point, the special effects were really bad and maybe like the ending didn't.
I mean, Session 9 got overlooked for that reason. You know, like it just looked like it was a straight DVD.
Yeah, that
movie,
I went back. It looked so like digitally shot sometimes. It looked like a TV. We talked about that, you know. But, I don't know. I don't see where the hate comes from because it's not – there's nothing that's like, oh, God, fucking idiots. Why did they do that? You know, it's just like, yeah, the effects are pretty bad. And, yeah, it goes really fast. There's a lot of road that's just like kind of like glossed over because it's a long book that – actually, it's not – it's one of his shorter books, to be honest. I think a lot of people are just like, I like the book. I hate the movie, you know?
Yeah.
It's not bad. It's really not bad. You should probably watch it and
go –
Yeah,
I haven't read the book, so I
had they had
–
say the budget was $2 million. I have no idea what it was. Had they had $10 million, they could have made a compelling ass good movie.
Yeah.
And I think it's just they got hit with like, well, what can we do with what we got? You know? None of it's bad. It's just not big enough for a lot of people's, I don't know.
Do you have Amazon Prime?
Of course.
Seriously, watch Green Room, please.
Like, oh, it's on streaming?
Next week. Yeah. That's
great. I'll get it on Blu-ray. I don't like streaming.
I might buy it. It's that good. It's excellent. It's really fucking good.
I tried to watch the new Top Gear, the Grand Tour, and like, buffer.
Yeah.
You know, oh, skip a couple frames here. Like, I'm very much, if I see any skip frames, I just get really pissed off. But if it's the only way to get it, I will watch it kind of thing, but whatever.
What else you got?
I watched Approaching the Unknown, which is an Interstellar ripoff with Mark Strong, which sounds super awesome. And it was only DVD, so there's no Blu-ray to, like, could be really pretty. Mm. He's basically in a space thing going to Mars on a mission to, like, start colonizing. So he's by himself. He's like, oh, space crazy. Could be really good. It was like, why did you make this? Oh, Interstellar did really good. Make something quick. Mark Strong's an amazing
that
actor.
Happens, you know?
Mark Strong is a fucking fantastic actor. And they just did not utilize...
There's a movie coming out, I don't know what the fuck it's called, but it's got like Jake Gyllenhaal and Ryan Reynolds, and either on a space station and something happens.
Oh, you're right. Yeah.
And then it kind of seems like a post-gravity kind of thing.
Everyone's on the like, oh, let's go to space and have a guy kind of go crazy.
I'm not going to complain because I love these things.
Right.
You know?
That's why I got really excited for it. And then I watched it and it was just like...
I don't know what this movie's about.
Why'd you put Luke Owen Wilson
something
in it?
Something happens.
Yeah.
What? Like, something happens in that room. What? Well, you gotta come see it, you know, which I guess is what trailers used to be. But like, and I'm like, I don't know. Is it an alien? Is it something goes crazy? What happens?
Right.
Somebody just took a shit, smells real bad. It was just like,
someone took a shit in a Pringles can.
What's
and left
going
it there?
On? Yeah.
I watched Pain and Gain.
Okay.
That's a good Michael Bay movie.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
It's one of the, it's...
You mean like a good movie that's by Michael Bay or a good Michael Bay movie?
Did I say Michael Bane? No. Man, Mark Wahlberg makes you hate him in that movie.
Yeah, but I've heard people say a lot of good things
about it. That's why I watch it, because it got decent, you know, like, hey, I know it's a Michael Bay movie, but you should see it. It's still good. It's good characters, and it's based off real, like, this really happened, which makes you go, are you fucking... As you're watching it, you're going, this shit fucking happened? I cannot believe this. Yeah, it's worth
Speaking
watching.
Of... shit that really happened. I have a movie to interject real quick, but we'll keep going on your list.
You go because the next thing I'm going to say is the
last
thing.
Have you ever heard of Roar?
Roar?
Yeah, Roar, like R-O-A-R.
Sure, I roar all the time.
No, I mean like
I'm
a
like,
movie
oh.
called Roar.
No.
Okay, so it was released in 1981 in Europe and then it never made it over here. And it got re-released just last year, like in 2014 or 2015. And it is...
Is it technically a re-release if it was never released?
Yes. So, yeah, I guess. So, because it didn't go in the theaters or whatever. It was like film festivals and things like that. Its tagline is, there were no animals harmed during the filming of this movie, but there were over 70 injuries in the cast and crew.
Wow.
Roar is a movie. They shot in California, and it was supposed to be like, we wanted to raise awareness about like African animals and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it has hundreds... I don't, maybe not hundreds, looks like hundreds of untrained, huge lions, tigers, pumas.
Wait.
Fucking cheetahs.
Bears?
Not bears. Elephants,
I fucking
though.
Lost me.
Elephants.
Lost me. No bears. Not if it, lions, tigers, no bears. I'm
and these
out.
And these actors that are not animal trainers or anything like that, and it's just like about a dude who's supposed to be in Africa. Like,
it's like Grizzly Man?
It's like I put it on while
Do you remember when we went and saw Grizzly Man?
Yeah.
And we were in this theater with a bunch of older people and it was like so fucking serious, and then me, you, and my wife were there, and there was parts where we were laughing and we had to look around and go like, oh my God, no one else is laughing
at this.
This
isn't supposed to be funny. It's I
can feel the warmth out the poop.
Yeah. I look over. I had it on just when my girlfriend was getting ready for a trip. And I look over. I go, wow, I suddenly need to stop talking shit on Grizzly Man. Like how crazy he was to go like hang out with bears like in real life. These people were 100 times more crazy to make this movie, and they were actually crazy. It wasn't like they and then they all got away with it. A good thing, like you know, no, like there's a whole history. You start reading about Melanie Griffith is in this movie because her crazy dad like helped fund it or whatever and put her in it, and she had to go to therapy and she had like have face surgery and shit because she almost lost an eyeball.
An eyeball.
There were like they say between 70 and 100 like injuries. Yeah. And
what are they doing?
It's a fucking 80. It's even though it's 1981. It's a 70s exploitation movie. So there's not really any plot.
Movie or a documentary?
It's a movie. It's a movie. I say in quotes because it's an exploitation movie, which means like there's not really a plot. It's just kind of like a lot of things happening.
Yeah.
So it was just like, oh, now the lions and they're gonna chase us here, and now this thing's gonna kind of happen. We're gonna be. It's insane.
You see people constantly getting hurt?
Yes. But it's a movie, so you're supposed to say to yourself, oh, it's a stunt.
Yeah.
No, they're getting hurt. Not the animals, the people. There's scenes where it's just like, the director must have been like, now just run from this doorway across this courtyard over here. And 15 lions chase them and knock him down and like bite him and like all these things. And you're just like, what is going on?
Like the Revenant for real?
It's like the Revenant for, yes. It's like the Revenant. It's like a whole movie like that.
The Roarvenant.
Right, but everybody's pretending like it's everything's fine. What did you call it?
The Roarvenant.
The Roarvenant. Yeah. Yes. Anyway, you should at least just pull up a trailer just to like see like these people are fucking insane. The injuries are like on film. They're not
right.
There's like parts where there's people walking around with blood on their face.
But do you feel good? Like that's what you get.
Kinda.
That's the motto in our house. My wife wants to get it emblazoned, like on a piece of wood.
That's what
you get. Because every time something happens, or someone hurts themselves in the house, or like something's broken, you go, "Well, that's what you get."
I feel like that's what you get is like kind of the rallying cry of your family. Like,
it really is. I thought it was funny. She's like, "No, I think we should get that made and put that up on the fridge or something like that." Like when you walk into our house above the threshold, it just says, "That's what you get."
That's what the Grizzly Man. That's what you get. You got ate by bears.
At the end of the Grizzly Man, she would have been like, "We would have taken like that's what you get." And like, what the fuck. You know,
it's just a great drinking movie. Like whatever, it's like watching. You just go, wow, how are any of you alive? Wow, holy shit! There's 100 lions in this room with you, and they're biting each other and fighting with each other, and you're just standing there in the middle of it. It's insane. Anyway, that's it. I just wanted to throw that in there. So besides that,
that's fucking funny. I'm gonna take a look at that. I watched Star Wars.
Yep.
Which I said.
Yeah. Confirming that didn't need to be a part of your life.
Now that we're so far into this podcast, it's been so long already. I'll just say this. That first movie is the one I remember watching the most and liking. There are scenes in that movie that are good. The garbage scene and, you know, maybe the Death Star getting shot down. It's whatever. That movie's hot garbage, though. It's too long. It's just, oh my God, I'm going to get so many people angry with me, and I don't care.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I'm just going to sit back and let you talk. Because,
so like, fine. Dawn of the Dead's made in the 70s, and they're not the best actors, but like, you can let a lot of it go. Flyboy's a bad actor. The girl, she's also not a very good actress, and she even said, I was not an actress. I lied, said I'd done stuff to get the role, you know? Peter's a great, Ken Foree is awesome, you know? But.
You're saying Ken Foree should have been in Star Wars?
Oh God, he could be, well. Can't Lando Carl? He's Calrissian's good.
There can only be one black person in Star Wars.
No,
it was already taken by Billy Dee Williams.
Mark Hamill is a great voice actor. He's a great Joker. He's great and stuff, but he was a fucking bad actor back then. He didn't know what he was doing. Same thing goes for Carrie. Well, she was all right. Harrison Ford. This is like his character is written that, of course, he's going to be the most interesting person. But even then, the acting is so stilted at times. Like, I feel like each take was like 3 seconds too long. Like, the camera would, and then the camera would roll for a couple seconds and then say your line. So we're just going to stare at you for a couple seconds. So there's no lead up to like, oh, you're going to say your line with emotion. You're just kind of like waiting. The camera's looking at you and then you say your line. Why was there that dead space before? It was awkward. Whatever. Are you going to, I mean, I know the whole internet is, oh, God, you like Star Wars.
I'm not gonna, I don't need to do anything. The whole world's going to do it for me.
How you feel. Like, do you agree or disagree?
Star Wars, real quick for me, I watched those movies all the time when I was a kid. I had like a VHS box set, whatever. I didn't have any friends. I would fucking, like, how am I going to spend today? I'll just watch all of these. And then I watch all the Indiana Jones movies.
That was my next thing I was going to say.
And so...
Let's get to the end. Are they really good? Are they okay?
No, they're really... Well, Return of the Jedi is not good. It's not as good, okay. But I still like it. I think the first movie is the best. I think that Empire Strikes Back is, like, way overrated. It's funny, everything you say about being slow and stuff like that. I think that's actually some things you could level towards the second one. No, they're amazing.
Okay, so they're not good.
I also watched Star Wars for the first time in fucking years last year, and I like rekindled my.
So I watched the despecialized editions because I didn't want to watch, you know, hear this stupid shit of like, oh, now there's this new thing in the background that wasn't there before.
CGI fucking Jabba.
I will say this. So did he put in Greedo shooting first later on?
Yeah.
Fuck that. Okay, I'll go with every other fucking Star Wars fanboy. No. Just watch the way that scene plays out. Han Solo is getting a shot off because of everything that's happened. That's fucking stupid to change these things. That's a whole other discussion, I guess.
So they changed it. He changed it so he shoots first and then he shoots.
Right.
Then he changed it again. But so the next time he does it, it's like they both kind of shoot at the same time or something. I don't know. But it's still not back to the way it was supposed to be.
The lead up in that scene is very much like, no, he doesn't. Yeah. It's just, even I can be
He's
like,
a scoundrel.
I agree with everybody else.
He's a fucking space pirate.
Right.
That's something that he would do.
It feels so like there's just awkward acting in a lot of it. Very stilted, very just. Too not too long overall, just like some shots are just like cut a second or two out at the beginning and the end. It's like why are you staring at the actors?
Right.
They don't have any emoting. They're just standing there looking at another person. Also, Carrie Fisher is really attractive. I do find her attractive. Not because of the scene when she's all
so did
naked.
Harrison Ford, apparently.
What?
She's like, she has like a tell all book like this year.
Yeah, I know.
She had an affair with him or something.
Sorry, moving my mic around, making noise. Everyone has like the big boner fanboy crush on her, and I don't see it because, like, oh, she was almost naked in the scene. But you can see the sides of her. I think she's just really pretty. I think she has a really nice facial features, but
yeah,
whatever.
Luke Skywalker is supposed to be whiny. Han Solo is supposed to be a space scoundrel.
Okay. He starts off as a boy, desert stuff. And then he meets Ben, and they go on a little adventure, and then, you know, they blast off into space, and now he's in a fucking X-Wing. Where did the Rebel go, hey, you know what? I'm going to let you lead a squadron of X-Wings. Did, like, 9 months pass, and he went through, like, basic training and became a pilot in the Rebel Army?
Do you know
army?
Why that's really funny that you brought that up?
Why?
Because you still haven't seen Force Awakens yet, right?
No, I have not watched it.
So...
I watched the first 5 minutes.
There's people who watch Force Awakens, and one of the massive complaints is that how the hell did this character learn how to do this stuff that quickly? And this is an immediate back and forth where people go, well, go back and look at the original Star Wars. Like, he just all of a sudden knows how to do those things. Like the parody between them.
Yeah,
like, you can't criticize one and not criticize the other. So this is interesting for somebody that never really watched the movie. Because you're not saying that because you heard any of those arguments.
Right.
You're literally just saying that.
I'm telling you what I
felt. He says things like, you infer that he was, like, flying around with his friends and stuff like that. That's not much harder than us shooting things in whatever canyon.
I shot a muskrat with a little .22 rifle. I can handle an elephant gun.
Yeah.
No, it's, there's just, like, logical things. Just, how the fuck did you get to this? What?
Yeah.
My wife, she didn't watch the first one. She grew up watching these. She actually watched them all. She had the VHSs and shit. She's like, I haven't watched them in a long time. And she didn't watch the first one with me. She watched, like, the very end, the first one, and then watched the other two. She's just like, are any of the things they're saying make any sense? Oh, I got a tie coming in on your .02 vector. And I'm like, no. It's just a bunch of, like, fake military jargon to make it sound like...
Well, it is. I mean, you know the story behind that. So the first movie is part Kurosawa movies.
Yeah, yes,
and part Dam Busters. Which I had never seen before, and I didn't even know that was a thing. Like, I'd heard that, but I didn't know. Like,
I don't know what that is.
It's a World War II, British World War II fighter pilot movie, which was, like, the number one. And I heard people say, I know that he was, World War II fighter pilot movies, that influenced Star Wars, but, I mean, you just thought, like, oh, because they fly around and say shit like that.
Yeah.
Then you watch just, like, 10 minutes of it, like, a Dam Buster sequence, and you're like, fuck. It's, like, literally, it's called Dam Busters because there's a dam. But they have to hit it at a very certain spot, and there's all these guns, turrets, and stuff that are shooting at them, and just the way that it's literally like, oh wow, okay, that's the movie you were inspired by,
I see what you're
and the things that they're saying, and the Red Leader, and yell, all that kind of stuff, it's all from that movie.
See, I'm more like, I was not in the military. My dad was drafted in Nam and didn't serve there, but was drafted and had to serve in Germany and shit like that. I come from a little bit of a military background house, but I'm not like a big, I'm not one of those guys like, I play fucking army on the weekends and go play paintball and shit like that, which is nothing wrong with that. And I don't have camouflage, but I like to follow military stuff. I like military stuff. I know what CAST means, you know, close air support. I get that there's a lot of jargon. And so a person on the outside would be like, what the fuck are you, what's an OPSEC? You know, I don't know any of that stuff. But it's funny when you watch it and you're like, they're just literally like, I don't know, get a thesaurus out, get another word for this. It just, none of it makes any sense. It's just like throw words and letters and numbers at a screen, which I get it.
I mean,
no,
that's like half of all science fiction is.
Right. But I'm like, you could do a good job of trying. Make it sound a little bit appropriate.
Well, that's probably what, you know, Rogue One is going
to
do.
So there's this, I don't remember exactly what it is. But there's, and I'm excited to see Rogue One, mainly because it's not Star Wars. I mean, it is, but it's not.
There's no Jedi in it.
I mean, Jedi's are cool, though. I mean, if fucking what's his name?
Danny Tartakovsky.
If he made shit, I'd be like, I'll watch it, whatever. Yeah. There's a scene, I don't know if this is the one that I was thinking of, but there's something where he says he's going to hotwire the door. That's in the third one. He says hotwire. Now, I don't know if that's what it is or something. Carrie Fisher says something, and I go, you wouldn't know what a fucking car is. It's Star Wars. They make a very deliberate, jokey reference to something that, like, would make sense if you knew what a car, an automobile was. There are no automobiles in this universe.
Yeah, but you're only one step away now from being like, why do they have British accents? Why do they have American? Like, how does everybody speak the same language?
Because
like,
if you're going to make this big site, try to make it feel, like, authentic. There's just shit that, like, I didn't...
It's the opposite of it feeling authentic. It's supposed to be a faraway land that, like...
So don't make jokes about automobiles that don't exist in that world.
I guess.
Kind of like if someone nowadays, if a millennial makes a movie, or, like, the generation below us makes a movie eventually, right? I know it's an audio podcast. You can't see me. But if I do the telephone thing up to my ear, right? They're going to go, what is that?
Yeah.
What's the
symbol on the phone? I don't know. It's like a C.
You know, this is my phone. You know, like, well, this is a phone. Just my palm was in my head. But the idea that, like, if you make movies now and you want to have a certain plot device, you're like, I have to base my movie in the 90s because I don't want to have characters have cell phones.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You have to kind of know that if I make this movie and I have this idea, well, the fucking technology of today will ruin it.
Yeah.
The same kind of thing. Think about what you're talking about. They don't fucking have cars in Star Wars.
Yeah.
They have speeders and shit.
I'll say this. No, nobody's going to
No, you won't say anything. I'm going to keep talking.
Okay. Tell me more about...
Okay, so the first one, fuck it, whatever. Second one, I start watching, I'm like, this feels a lot cooler. This feels a lot better.
Yeah.
I look up, oh, it wasn't directed by George Lucas. No fucking wonder.
Yeah. It's same guy who did RoboCop 2.
I still don't think they're great because there were things about the second one that were just like, why did they have these things and these, whatever. I don't want to go into the... I just wanted to, like, overall. But the second and third one are so much better because they're not directed by... And I realized that. I didn't know that. I watched going, why is it so much better? And I looked at it and went, oh, these are directed by other people.
Yeah.
No wonder they feel
better.
Which
is why most people agree with you. So there you go.
I like, you know, they're not bad. But there's just still such stupid shit about it. Like, Luke, you've had that lightsaber the whole time. Why didn't you just fucking use it in the beginning?
Beginning of what?
Like when they're in the speeders in the third one, and he's hanging on to Carrie Fisher, he has a fucking lightsaber. Why didn't he just like poke the guy with it? They're like bumping into each other like a high speed chase. You could just stab because he's like, oops, I got it now.
Budget and whatever. Like you can't just do whatever you want willy nilly. It's not like today where you just previs your whole fucking movie and then do
it that way. Yeah, I don't want to get into the second ever movie, but they're better, but they're not great. But I still don't really care about the series. It surprised me a lot. Seeing how many people go on about Star Wars for so many decades and like just the fantasticalness of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, these three movies are what you kind of said. They're very small movies. Mm-hmm. There is no amazing Star Wars universe. It's just like, hey, this kid got a lightsaber and there's Yoda. And then, oh, well, they fought in some snow and they fought in a forest with like rudimentary with rocks and shit. Where's all this crazy thing that makes people Star Wars so...
I mean, that stuff's there, you know. They talk about other planets, other things, you know.
Why is there a talking fish?
Talking? Oh, that guy?
Allah Akbar.
Admiral Akbar. He's like become like a fan favorite.
I know it's a tarp, but like, he's a fucking fish.
It's Star Wars.
It's kind of like
just lizard people and fucking like it's Star Wars.
But I will give Star Wars credit over Star Trek. And the one thing like when Star Trek, the older stuff was just like, hey, it's a person. We painted them green.
Yeah.
They're an alien. At least they actually had all kinds of weird looking shit in Star Wars. And maybe go like, well, you know, they're all bipedal for the most part.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, they're too close to humans, but at least they're like aliens. And then the other ones, it's just like, hey, she's got three eyes.
Yeah. Well, that was cheaper.
I get it. Even like the new stuff that was the remake, and I expected more bigness, not just such claustrophobic movies about these 3-4 characters. I thought there was more to Star Wars.
No, it's a
a lot of it's inferred, it's a family
saga,
right? Kind of like you talk about, like, you know,
which is why I
the Death Star blows up, but someone on another planet, like fucking million miles, 10 billion miles away, is like, the what? I just live here. I don't fucking know what's going on.
Right.
Like, there's so much more to that universe that should have been explored than just.
Well, it's kind of like what they're getting at now, I guess. But
yes,
you
can only do so much. But I was surprised that 3 movies. It's literally just like, oh, this is like a couple months.
There's
after
still
the last
stuff
one.
Is still there. Like in that first movie, you know, where you have like all your generals talking to each other and like, oh, the Senate approved this today. Like, there's this.
I like that stuff.
I
more.
Do too.
You know,
because we're the boring people, right?
Yeah.
As I say, no politics. That stuff's boring. Like, I guess I call it just like setting up your world and
yeah.
Anyway, yeah, you don't
Star
want to
Wars, right?
Stars,
like, this is the conversation I normally wouldn't have because people are going to bitch about it, but, right. like, I'll put it out there. I don't fucking care.
I'll say this. I have rekindled my affection for this franchise. I'm not, like, dead. It's not dead to me like it was before because I was fucking annoyed by it. I'm still annoyed by it.
I mean, I watched the prequels when they came out because that was an age where I'm like, oh, I can watch this. I'm like, I like Clone Wars.
Well, that's what bounced me out. What I was going to say earlier is that the age I was and when those came out, if those had been good, I would have probably turned into, like, a full-on fucking Star Wars geek nerd guy.
Yeah.
But they were like, boo, you know. They were just like, meh. And then it was like, okay, life, and I don't care about movies or nerd stuff anymore or anything like that. And then it didn't come back to nerd stuff until, like, later.
Until you met me again.
Yeah. No, before that.
Whatever.
This, anyway.
For me, for people who know me,
I still do not think that they are the end-all be-all. So I will go there with you.
Yeah.
I like these movies, but I ain't going to be like, fucking Star Wars, jizz face. Like, I'm not,
jizz face,
you know, I'm
Jesus.
Not, you know, it's
people
not,
who know me know I'm not into fantasy. I'm not into wizardry. And this, I think this is why, because this does feel like wizards in space.
It is. It's
a lot of it's just like, oh, you can just make up whatever you want. Where, you know, I appreciate Star Trek. I remember watching it as a kid. I haven't watched it in years. I kind of want to go watch The Next Generation. Just go see it, like watch it from beginning to end and see if what I think about it now. But yeah, not Star Wars, no. Anyways, that was longer than a Star Wars minute that I wanted it to be. Oh, God. My kid's been watching Batman Beyond. He's 4. I don't think that's appropriate, but oh well. He lets me take a nap on the weekends. There's a really good video on the internet called Why Do Marvel's Movies Look Kind of Ugly?
Oh, yeah.
It's a really good video.
Is that the one with the music?
No.
It's talking about the music?
It's about color grading, about how they all look the same.
Somebody also does a really great video. The Every Frame and Painting guy?
Yeah.
He does a video on the music in the Marvel movies. It's the same thing.
I was going to say that it is so disappointing and depressing when you find someone who makes a really great video essay. And you go like, oh, let me check all their other videos. Like, they have none. Like, that was kind of like what we had done in the beginning. We made, like, this one big thing, and then it's like, well, what do we do next? Like, do we keep doing this? Luckily, we kind of keep making the same thing, hopefully. I like to think that we try to do new stuff, but also kind of, oh, I really liked your video on this. I would watch another video on some other subject that maybe I'm not even, you know, Hellraiser comics. Like, well, I'm interested. Like, show me.
Yeah.
You guys make interesting content. This one guy is just like, the rest of his videos were just, oh, do more of those. You have no more of that, what you just did.
Yeah.
And then the guy who did the Marvel, or I don't know, he only had 2 videos.
Yeah. I found
a guy
like that last week. He did, I don't remember how it came up, but he did why the Killing Joke animated movie is really bad. But he ended up talking a lot about like comics history and stuff like that in the 90s and things. And it was fucking funny and it was insightful. There's this part where he just like literally starts listing off the names of 90s comic book characters, kind of like I made fun of a little bit. And it was fucking funny. And I rewatched that part like several times. It made me laugh. I'm like, cool, let me go watch all these other videos that maybe he did on comic books. And then it's like, oh, it's like all about Dark Souls the opposite, like, so he's a social justice warrior, you know, thing. So it's like a lot of like watching the who the fucking Milo Yo-Yo, who are the freckled red pill bald guy, I don't fucking know, like watching that guy's videos and seeing what's wrong with him. Wow, okay, never mind.
I don't internet like
anyway
that.
My point is there's a lot of other like just opinion stuff, right? And it wasn't like, that's too bad, you were good at this, like I wish you had done more.
It's
of
one
it.
Of the things we kind of struggle with on this YouTube channel, like the idea that we don't want to just like, oh, does that go like on a separate channel? Like, we don't want to like start filling it up with like, hey, here's 50 hours of me playing Dark Souls 3, you know?
Yeah.
But sometimes it's like, well, I don't know where else to put it, and maybe I want to share it with somebody. Maybe they're like, I don't know, you know, whatever. That's why we're doing one playthrough Resident Evil, but I'm not going to start like streaming video games all the time. But yeah, it is like, keep your shit. Like, where's your video essay channel? I want all those and none of the other stuff.
Right.
I was going to say Sleeping Dogs 2, stuff that came out there. I don't know if you... I haven't gone too much into it, but Vice Gaming / Waypoint, they had, like, Patrick Klepek had, like, 300 pages of documents of, like, what Sleeping Dogs 2 was going to be. And it's so depressing because I like Sleeping Dogs so much, that game.
Mm-hmm.
And it just sucks that it's never going to get made because they closed the studio.
Bummer.
Yeah.
I was going to go about Silent Hills.
Yeah, that's a good example.
We can do a quick comic book geek thing. Also, it was revealed recently that Junji Ito was involved too. I know you don't know who that is, but yeah. He's a very highly respected horror manga artist. I don't read a lot of manga, but I have read his stuff, and he's amazing. Like, this thing keeps, like, it's like, who else was fucking involved? Did you reanimate H.P. Lovecraft and also like every other, and you got Stephen King too. Just like every other person that's like amazing, like horror kind of like person, put them together, work on this video game that's never going to get made.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, we can talk about Death Stranding for a second. So that trailer is fucking weird and scary looking, I thought. Some like horrific kind of stuff in it. So it kind of makes me hope that maybe a lot of the.
I'm going to say with all that shit, it's always like, it's just meant there to be weird for now. There's no fucking game yet, so, like, I'm not going to even... It's not worth talking about other than, hey, it's got my attention.
For me, I'm saying it came off to me as more, like, weird horror thing than, like, a Metal Gear thing.
Yeah,
so,
but again, the idea, like, we have no idea.
I know.
Just there to, like, pique your interest, and it piqued my fucking interest, yes. Yeah. I like to see the guys, the people.
It doesn't look like Metal Gear Solid 6. To me, it looks like maybe a lot of our leftover ideas from this video game that didn't get made. That's all my hope.
Whatever. All right, emails. On to emails. We've been here way too long. Okay. But hey, it's been a long time since we've talked.
People like this. They like ears.
We haven't seen each other, like physically seen each other in about...
I just haven't talked to you. Most of the time I'm like, I've fucking talked to you. I don't want to talk to you again.
Yeah.
But I actually haven't talked to you in a while. So
my wife was like, because remember you're like, oh, last time I saw your kid, he was doing this. I'm like, he hasn't been here for like 4 or 5 weeks, which means you really should be working on the AVP video because, we did the Blackfire thing, but... It's been a while.
Yeah, I know. But you understand, like, I
don't care. You don't have excuses. Shut up and work on the project.
Okay.
It's a lot.
This is not appropriate.
It's going to be
not appropriate.
25-minute long video about Aliens versus Predator comic books. All right?
I am already a fifth of the way through it.
Emails. Okay. We got quite a few, actually. I was surprised because we had a couple, and then all of a sudden I checked
today. Some of them are fucking long.
Yeah. Whatever. I feel that now we're going to rush through the emails, but that was, like, my favorite part of today, but now it's getting late. We had to fucking do it, but whatever. All right. First one, I wish you got your damn laptop in here so you could.
Oh, you want to read this one?
Yeah, I don't want to read all of them. I sound stupid. My voice is dumb. I sound like I have a lisp. Do I sound like I have a lisp? Hey, you know that? Do I have a lisp?
Do you really want me to answer that question?
Do I?
No, I don't.
No, I don't think I. No one thinks I do, but I feel like I hear myself and whatever. All right, this is from Gizmo13. LOL.
Your dog sent you an email.
Yeah, my dog's name is Gizmo. She's saying, "Hey, what's up?" This is from Deutschland. I don't know how to use this. Those aren't English words. Those are also aren't like alphanumeric characters that I can recognize either. So I don't know what the first two say, but it's from Deutschland. In one of your videos, you talked about Stephen King. So what is your favorite, least favorite books of Mr. King? Keep up the good work, guys. Thank you, Gizmo.
I'm willing to admit that you're probably a bigger fan of read more than I have. So go ahead.
That's the thing. He has so much that I honestly am not like a expert, but like I have like made a dent in like how much shit he's written, but I've read probably like 10 of his books.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like Duma Key,
mm-hmm.
which we may notice in one of the things. I enjoyed it, mm-hmm. but it's a bad book.
Yeah.
Obviously we both read Dark Tower and, you know, just got really caught up in the Dark Tower shit.
Yeah. Can I just set that aside? Because like, I'm just going to say Dark Tower and I just assume you'd say the same thing.
Not even close.
Really? Oh, you're going to be the stand.
No. I like The Stand a lot, but it's really weird at the end.
What? What's your...
You don't know where I'm going with this?
Your favorite Stephen King
book? My favorite Stephen King thing is It.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I had this really weird... I had that book when I was a teenager, and I remember trying to read it, and I read like 50 or 60 pages of it, and then I like put it down and was kind of like, oh, I don't know. I mean, I'd watched like the TV movie and shit, and I liked it, but I tried to read the book, didn't do it. And then like, you know, 10 years later, in my 20s, I like dug the book out of wherever I had a bunch of books, and... I was like, oh, shit, I'm going to try to read this. And that was when we were working security. I had free time. I read all 1,100 pages of that book. There's something weird and emotional about that movie that just fucking grabbed me. And there's a very specific scene near the end, which, I mean, if people haven't read it, you're not going to. I'm going to say what happens. But they're in the sewer at the end trying to get out as kids. And some people have a really, really problem with this scene. And I don't know if you know what I'm going to talk about right now.
Giant ant?
Huh?
Like the giant
ant? No, this is after that.
Okay.
This is when all the boys have sex with Beverly. And they're like 12.
Oh, in the book?
Yes.
Okay.
This does not happen in the made-for-TV movie. It's not oh my God, children having sex, I got a boner. Like, that's what people think. Like, they get all mad about it online. They talk about, like, oh, child rapers, whatever. It's pedophilia. No, it, I mean, if you read the fucking book and you understand what's going on, is that after they supernaturally have, like, their group of friends has this bond between them that's beyond supernatural bond. Like, it's stronger than just what it is. That's how they actually defeat the monster in the beginning. After they defeat the monster and he goes back into hibernation, that bond starts to go away and they start to, like, not feel close to each other. They're like already drifting apart, even like hours after what happened. So she takes it on herself to say, no, we need to stick together to get out of here alive. So she has sex with each one of them in the sewer in the dark, which, yes, that sounds really bad and really crazy. But it, like, it creates that bond again just temporarily enough for them to then power their way out and survive and get out of the sewer. And people hate it, but I looked at it as like the, like a very beautiful, like, it's sad. Because it also happens at the end of the book, and it happens in the movie, that Mike Hanlon is like the one guy who stays in Derry. He writes down everyone's address and how to contact them. And what happens is when they actually defeat the fucking monster at the end, the point is that that bond's going away again. Like, they're already forgetting each other for who they are. Like, oh my God, I forgot who you were. When you called me, I didn't even know who's Mike Hanlon. He's writing their names down in a book, and even the fucking ink or whatever, the pencil, is fading faster and faster. That he's having to rewrite it down because the universe is going like, no, you will not see each other again. I will not allow it. That what you had is gone. So, like, this really, like, trying to stay together as friends and try to be this, like, loving family, but the universe is telling you you're losing it. You're not going to get to keep it. It's fucking depressing. And I thought it was beautifully written. And the way that that pedophile scene in the sewers, I thought it was really sad. Like, not in the, like, I don't know how to describe it, but it was just very much like a, it's very drastic. I was not expecting that, but I understand why it made sense. And it was the most powerful thing you could probably write was, hey, let's have a group of teenagers have sex with all the boys have sex with this girl. But she makes, they don't want to. They're like, no, I can't do this. And she's like, no, we have to. And it's just like, whoa, this is really out of left field, but I think it works. I don't know.
I didn't read it, so I can't.
And it's,
it sounds weird.
This, just the idea of like, because it goes back to like my favorite movies, Goonies.
Yeah.
You know, this childhood adventure and the fact that like, after it's over, it's like,
they all have sex with the Chinese kid, I remember.
That's Goonies too.
Okay.
No, it's just, it's disheartening because it makes you think about your childhood. It makes you think about like what happens as you grow older and the things you forget and just the way that life goes on.
Yeah. You know, nostalgia and like you get old and you have to let go of these things that are, you know, I mean, he's done books like Stand By Me is that, right? Or The Body, I guess, is the story that it's based on. But that's the same thing. It's like that last summer trip that they make, you know, to go find it and camp out in the woods and stuff like that. It's the last time you'll ever feel that way. That's the last summer, like after the week, literally the next summer, like you're going to be thinking about girls or like life's going to get in the way. There's going to be problems. There's going to be worries and anxieties. And it is sad. You know, that male boy thing, like your last summer as a boy, right?
Yeah. But it's, again, it's not even about like,
but friendship's
your sex,
a part of
your gender,
it, you know?
Or whatever. I mean, it's just very much.
Well, it kind of is because he doesn't write it from the female perspective, right? Because
no. But like, I'm saying in this, like, what I feel out of it, like, I know what you're talking about, but like, just in general, the idea that like I have all the friends I had from when I was a kid, like, none of them,
right?
You know,
yeah.
And it's almost depressing to look at your life and go, like, man, why did I waste my time doing this or that or whatever? But just the idea that, you know, the bond that these kids share in this book is fucking amazing. Like, it's like the TV movie does a good job of like showing it, but like, these are a group of losers and they only have each other. They've made fun of and whatever, they're nerds. They're so strong, but then like one summer, and then by then someone's family moves away and then someone else moves across town, and
that's,
you know,
inevitable. Like, everybody experiences this.
But in this point, it's like they even try and the universe is just like, it's supernaturally saying no. And it's super sad. Like, it's super depressing.
Yeah.
But in a very, Stephen King writes horror books, but I think people like think about like, oh, he's the master of horror, and you're like, monsters. I'm like, no,
he's
fucking
like the master of character development.
He's deep, man. He gets really deep sometimes. So
too deep.
Well, they got a little too deep in that sewer.
Yeah.
Boom. Okay.
I mean, Dark Tower is my favorite. I guess like that's kind of like an obvious thing. If we're gonna put Dark Tower aside, I guess I got really into the Richard Bachman books when I was younger because those were coming out. Those were like his other pen name,
right?
That he was doing. I don't know when those were actually originally published. There's a book called The Long Walk that I would like to revisit that like really affected me when I was young, and it's another kind of similar coming of age thing, but it's more of a science fiction book.
Yeah.
I thought that was really good. Bag of Bones was the book that knocked me off the Stephen King train.
So I didn't finish that one. So that, I guess that would be my least favorite. Next question.
Oh, Jesus. I'm sorry. Reading texts and kids. I mean, I've only read, like, It, The Shining, The Stand, Dark Tower, Duma Key. Like, I can't even think. I'd have to, like, go back and, like, what are the random books. Like, I have Salem's Lot. I didn't read that one, I don't think. I kind of finished it or something. So, yeah, I mainly read fucking Aliens and Predator books in my teenage years and Resident Evil and stuff. So, all right, next question. All right, our next question comes in from Chase. Hey there, royal badasses over at the Alpha Rookie headquarters, a.k.a. my garage.
Is that what he wrote, or is that what you're just saying?
That's what I'm saying. Okay. Yeah. First off, I thank you guys for creating what might be the greatest YouTube channel in history. That's fucking shut up. Stop. We're not. No. That's not even close. But thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Just don't. We're trying. Second, I was wanting to ask you guys something, and I'm sorry if it gets a little bit morbid. Oh, I like this one. You can answer this one pretty much. I recently finished my first semester in college, and naturally I got stressed out a lot. If you're stressed out in your first semester, you need to tone that shit down, because the first semester is supposed to be easy.
I don't know. I did like 18 units. Like, I front loaded. Like, my first year was way worse than my later ones.
One unit in the summer preceding it, because they made us do SOAR, and then 11 units for my first semester. Wrong track. You should be doing a lot. Not a lot, but like, you should do quite a bit in your beginning, because you don't want to get like, oh, this is fuck, college is easy.
Yeah.
High school is so much harder than college for me, until I realized, oh, about a year or two in, now the hard classes start. Now I'm doing like engineering shit. They don't fuck around. You know, you can't be lax about it.
You have no idea what he's doing.
Anyways, one way I found a relief was to relieve the stress, take a shit, that's how. Watch violent movies and read gory comic books. I can agree with that. It's fun. So I was wondering if you amazing comic book guy gurus could recommend any comics that would be considered excessively violent. I'm not the comic book guru. That's Ryan. I've already tried Outcrossed, which I assumed you were going to say. And while it was fulfilling that violent need, it was also deeply disturbing me. I was considering The Midnighter, but I was just wondering what you guys had to recommend. Keep up the amazing work. Have a great time whenever you're reading this. Sent from my iPhone.
So Midnighter, I'm assuming he's talking about, there's a superhero character named Midnighter. I think that's what he means.
I was considering The Midnighter.
I think he's talking about that. Midnighter's kind of made a resurgence in DC Comics.
Thing?
No.
Maybe he's not talking about that.
Well, I don't know what he's talking about then. I don't know what The Midnighter is. But Midnighter's a fairly popular character, and there's a lot of interesting things to talk about with him. But if that's not what you're talking about, then I unfortunately don't know what you're talking about. If you are talking about Midnighter, which has been a really popular series in the last year, he's a character that is from originally The Authority by Warren Ellis and then Mark Miller. That stuff's great. And if you think that, like, if you're interested in the new stuff, I'd actually urge you to go back and read the original stuff, read The Authority. That shit's awesome. Midnighter was essentially like a Batman kind of analog. And it was kind of a funny stick your middle finger up at like Justice League and stuff like that. Like, the Authority were like characters that they lived up in a satellite above the sky and everything. The big difference was that they were just like, fuck all this not kill people, not get involved business. We're gonna go and like take out genocidal leaders and all this kind of stuff.
Cool. I like that.
That we're gonna get shit done. That was the whole idea. And so there was Midnighter and Apollo. And Midnighter was like a Batman analog and Apollo was a Superman analog, and they were gay. Couple.
Yeah.
So that was kind of fun. Midnighter's pretty rad. Midnighter has not really, I guess it's like a superpower. He can just see every move that something's gonna make, like a chess player, and then he, you know, acts accordingly.
So he's Sherlock. He's Robert Downey Jr.
He's essentially
Sherlock
that. Yeah. So he doesn't have super strength or anything like that, or super fast, but he knows everything that you're gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
Not because he's psychic, because he just knows how something's gonna play out, and then he can kick your ass. So that's pretty cool.
So The Midnighter gets a recommendation.
I think so, yeah. It's not, I mean, the books can get gory, because he certainly gets violent. They fucking kill people.
Yeah. We talk a lot about Crossed.
Right.
Crossed 100 Years, which one was the one that you liked?
Crossed plus 100, I think, is plus actually 100. The best. So Crossed was created by Garth Ennis, which is the creator of Preacher.
Preacher.
Yeah. It's incredibly violent. But I think it's also like, I think it's trying to be funny, but then there's also parts where it's
which
actually
is the
trying
one
to be
where,
really
like, someone
up.
Gets beat with a dildo or
that's,
something.
That's in Crossed. That's in the original Crossed, right? So that's the part where you look at that and you're like, how do you take that seriously? That's obviously supposed to be funny.
Yeah.
But then there's parts where, and there's also things where they're like coming on bullets so they can shoot people with the bullets so they can like, they can turn them into Crossed, zombies from a distance. But then there's also parts in that book that are sincerely disturbing that are meant to be like, fuck, that was fucked up.
Yeah.
Cross Plus 100 is also fucked up, but I think it's a lot more even tempered. It's a lot more sincere. It's by Alan Moore, so you know, people know him from Watchmen and V for Vendetta and all that kind of stuff. He can still really, really tell a good story. The only thing I think probably holding it back for some people is going to be he does the thing where it's so far in the future that he starts creating like his own language.
Yeah.
So if you do not have any patience for like trying to understand what certain words mean and things like that, you're not going
to
have a good time.
I remember trying to read a book that was written in phonetic.
Yeah.
It was like an old like Southern, I can't remember what it is, but it was written and was like, this is so I get what they're going for, and it's not bad. I can't read this because I have to read really slowly to see what words they be saying. Like, right. You know.
What was I saying with that? Anyway, it's really good.
Any other horror? Obviously, if you haven't read the Hellraiser.
Something that's like, so something.
I was going to say, obviously, you've watched our stuff. You probably already like the Hellraiser stuff.
Yeah, but those aren't like really gory or anything like that. So,
but those are kind of depressing because they kind of make you contemplate life a little bit sometimes. And
right. Yeah, and that's and they're moody and dark and stuff like that. It sounds like he's kind of looking more along the lines of something that's like violent and fun. Oh shit.
Who wrote Oh Shit?
I don't know how gory they are, but they are kind of monster like horror books, but they're really funny and they might even hit you in like a sincere sweet spot. I would say The Goon.
I like The Goon a lot.
I fucking love The Goon. Again, like it's kind of it gets
How is it still not a movie?
Well, they tried.
I know.
Have you seen that Blur trailer that they did?
Yes, like a long time ago.
Paul Giamatti and...
yeah.
What's his face? Clancy Brown. Perfect. Perfect. So The Goon is great.
The Goon's more like a Ren and Stimpy in a way.
It's not that abstract, but yeah, it is more cartoon. Yes, it's like if Looney Tunes and Dick Tracy and zombies and monsters and Universal Monsters, yeah, that all kind of like had a baby together. That's sort of what The Goon is, which is pretty great. You might try a book. Maybe you can try this book out before I do. There's a book that's really popular called Hack Slash, and it is...
Is that like an anime?
No. I
mean, Hack Slash is like an anime video... Oh, no.
Is it? I don't...
I'm thinking like .NET Hack... Hack Slash is a Double Fine game where they like you hack the game as you play it or something like that.
Okay. Well, Hack Slash in the comic book world is about, like, you know, you have the survivor girl in the slasher movies.
Yeah.
So what if the survivor girl, like, that was like her thing. She went around taking out other, like, mass murdering monsters. and it's supposed to be funny, but it's also, like, really gory and stuff. So if you like watching a lot of slasher movies and stuff like that, you probably get a big kick out of it. She has, like, a sidekick who's, like, a big, hunking, like, Jason Voorhees-style character.
I got really scared that we weren't recording for a second.
Yeah. I don't know. That's what comes to mind right now. I'm sure I'll probably think of one as we're answering other questions, and then I'll blurt it out. Was that the end of the question, or was there more?
That was it.
Okay. Hopefully that helps.
Yeah, okay. We'll move on to the next email. Thank you for writing in, Chase.
Thank you.
Thank you for writing last time, or I don't know, whatever. Juan says, hello, Alpha and Rookie. Well, Alpha is technically Alpha Male. Did we ever go through that
stuff? I don't know.
Well, I'm the Alpha
people
Male.
People are getting it anyway.
Yeah, whatever. I want to say I'm a big fan of your channel. I'm glad people started to recognize more of your videos and the fact that you've grown a lot in the last month. Yeah, I think the Halloween, Hellraiser thing.
Big bump from Halloween.
Big bump, yeah. I'll take it. I want to question, what was the motive or the reason to make a channel, and why start with Alien, Predator, Fire and Stone video? Keep it up. Great content.
You want to do that one, or you want me to do it?
You know, we have spent years trying everything to, like, just make video games.
Are you really going to not let this just be my idea? Because that's the truth.
It's a mix. So, okay. What are you talking about?
Go ahead.
Okay. We're making card game. We're making video games, which we worked on that video game thing for a long time. We actually have some stuff that we were going to show eventually one day to you guys of like, hey, here's some old shit that we worked on. We were doing sound stuff when I was in school. We were dubbing stuff, the Dawn of the Dead thing and the I'm going to sword this shit out, the Conan the Barbarian thing. It's a sheep or whatever the fuck you did. What else did we? I feel like we've worked on quite a few things where we've just tried to do like independent, like let's make this or do that, and then you know, you did a Silent Hill style thing that you shot when you were in like Kentucky.
I did an alien thing.
Yeah, it was really bad, but
right. But
remember you like
I don't think it was that bad.
I feel like it became more because you went somewhere in the south and the east coast to like go to.
Well, I just got it. Okay.
You went to like abandoned.
You tell it from your side because I have a.
I remember you went to these abandoned mental asylum places on a tour. Mm-hmm. You got video footage and you put Silent Hill music on it and you cut it together. You're like, I like cutting video. And I'm like, I know it's fun, right?
Yeah.
And you said, well, why don't we just like actually do something with it, you know?
Well, and I'll take over a little bit here now. From my personal
thing. Oh, sorry. I've just always been like, hey, I want to create video content. I want to create audio content. I went to school for fucking audio and engineering and stuff like that. Like, I just want to, like, I want to make stuff.
Yeah.
I don't care what it is. I want to produce content. I don't care if it's video games. I don't care if it's board games. I don't care if it's YouTube shit. I just like, I like editing. I have a knack for like kind of quickly doing stuff, which I don't know if that's true anymore. It's like, I don't want to like just like, oh, toot my own horn. I'm really good at it because I was at one point. Now it's like everyone can do it. But I had good stuff back then when people didn't have this shit at home in my mid-20s. Fuck kids today. Now they have everything. Like, oh, my parents are rich and I have all this fucking editing software. Fuck you. I had to steal that shit like anyone else off the internet. But no, I spent like a good $1,300-$1,400 building and buying Pro Tools system when I was in college for myself rather than using like the school lab so I could do shit on my own. We did that fucking video game. We did Barrel Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we did a lot of stuff. So anyways, I just wanted to always create something. I didn't
right.
Care.
I thought you'd come up with that.
So that's why you're saying that your idea.
I like comic books. My job is to sell comic books. And I had written about comic books before. And I always said, it drives me nuts that you can write most of the content written on the internet about comic books are just reviews. They're just essentially consumer reviews. Like, oh, this new issue came out. Here's what we think. Should you buy it?
Yeah.
And not like, isn't anybody going to, like, movies and video games have like think pieces and fucking like things and all this kind of shit all over the place, content everywhere. And there's not that a lot of stuff for comic books. And then I also said, okay, even the ones that do stuff like that, it's just these giant blocks of text and they don't have any visuals. How can you talk about a visual medium without actually showing it? And then the next logical conclusion after that is, well, if you're going to do that, why don't you actually just make a video? Like, how hard is that? I bet I could do that.
And at that time, I was coming by the store on the way home from work and like picking up like comics and shit. Like, I was reading some stuff, and you were giving me some things that I was.
Well, I said I made so I put together this little, yes, little stupid alien thing, about alien comics. And why did I do that? I did that because one, I like them.
Yeah.
And two, I thought like I think that there's probably a niche audience for stuff like this. Like, this is like, oh, like, these comic books are actually cool, and maybe people don't know that, and they know about aliens, but they don't know that the comic books are cool.
Right.
And I showed it to you, and I just said, is this something, I don't know, is there like anything to this? And I thought you were going to say, like, you're fucking dumb, like, go away. But instead you went like, this is, you did say you're fucking dumb and this is stupid, but I think that we could do something with this. We could do like video content. There might be something here.
Yeah.
So that's why the first project ended up being the alien thing, was just because, well, that was like what I had already kind of started on, like, it's to some extent with that stuff.
But I mean, we even well before that, we were like, I was giving you the books, the novels, and you were giving me the omnibuses, and
sure, but
you
that's
know,
just life stuff. That's
but,
not.
But
like,
the idea that like
that's
we
not like
we
the
are
genesis of the like, specific thing.
But like, why did it start with Fire and Stone? Was one, it was topical, but two, we like Alien and Predator, you know?
Right. I didn't like all of a sudden become a fan of this stuff just to do that.
Right.
Honestly, I try with that stuff. It's what's something that will bring people to the table because they're fans of it, like with movies and
well,
stuff like
that. That's what I'm saying.
That's
why you were
fans.
Sharing it with me because right. You're like, I wasn't into comics, but you're like, dude, I know you love Alien. I know you love Predator.
Right.
Here, read the comics. I'm right. Like, okay, I don't have time for that, but whatever.
I'll do whatever I can do to get people into comic books. That's all. Like, it's not as popular as like video games and movies and shit like that. So anything I can do to get people to give it a shot. So, yeah, I don't know. That's sort of the genesis of that stuff. And we keep coming back to it because, honestly, I mean, we like that stuff, but it's popular.
Yeah, we didn't want to become the Alien Predator channel, but...
Yeah, so to answer the same question, that's just the opposite question, why don't you do more?
Yeah.
I don't want to end up becoming the Alien
Predator
channel.
Like, the sad part of it is that, I mean, yeah, we grew up with this, but it's just, I like that as much as I like Terminator.
Right.
And other shit, like, it has a big following in our own lives. Like, we grew up with it, but it's not the end-all, be-all. We're not the, like... Like I said, we don't want to be the Alien Predator fan site, but we sure shit watch a lot of Alien Predator content and talk about it and right. You know, all other stuff. But that's just one facet of our lives. You know, I'm fucking huge into zombies. That's my thing.
Yeah.
If I had a YouTube channel, it'd be nothing but zombie stuff. Like Craig Lines, he's a writer in the UK, Den of Geek and stuff like that. And he just was like contacted him once about the kung fu stuff, and he's just really into watching VHS ninja movies, like the really bad stuff. He put something on Twitter the other day, and it was like the back of the box of the VHS.
I saw that with the pink ninja.
The pink things. I'm like, see, that's what he's into. He's really into that shit. Like, he's the definitive. You want to talk about bad ninja movies from the 80s? He'll know.
Yeah.
You know, I like all kind of kung fu stuff. He knows ninja stuff. So yeah, thanks for the question, Juan. Next question, Zane, not Billy Zane, just Zane, because I don't like Billy Zane.
You don't like Billy Zane?
My wife, when we were watching Twin Peaks, she's like, he's good looking. I went, I'm going to kill myself. You've got to be kidding me. That fucking weird. He's in Sex and the City, too, I think. And he's got this.
And Tales from the Crypt, Demon Knight.
Oh, shit. That's my bad.
That's why I like Billy Zane. I don't know. I saw that when I was a kid.
I'm sorry.
I love that
he's
movie.
In Sniper with Tom Berenger.
Yeah.
That's a good fucking movie. That's, whatever. Billy Zane, fuck him.
Okay, anyway. But Zane, not fuck you.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Zane, a.k.a. Doomfella. Oh, shit. I forgot who this is.
Zane in the Membrane.
Your favorite commenter of all time. I will say that I do love your fucking comments. They didn't make me fucking laugh.
What?
The comments.
Oh, yeah.
They make me laugh because I was not expecting stuff like this. So, yeah. I don't even know where to go with this one. This email. I think it's about time you checked out some of my YouTube material. Considered me for the next couple Alphacasts. I would like to talk about Legends of the Dark Knight, the out-of-continuity anthology Batman series that started in the late 80s, which is, of course, your favorite Batman comic, which, of course, is my favorite Batman comic, yes. I think it's great. I can't read this fucking monitor. It's, like, sideways. I think it's a great merit to talk about said series because it's kind of obscure and minus a few of the more acclaimed series within it by some of the more acclaimed comic auteurs of our time, such as Granty Boy Morrison. I love that. Anyways, hit me up because I got quite a few of the trades. I also want to talk about post-Alan Moore Swamp Thing, which I know you probably would like to talk about.
Yeah.
Also, let's talk about Star Wars Devil Worlds, the two-issue miniseries collecting Alan Moore's Star Wars run. Buying things.
So, that's a lot. I kind of want to stay away from... The only reason we don't do, like, ever talk about Batman or anything like that is because I try really, really hard to stay away from anything that's, like, mainstream.
Also, there's so much Batman.
And there's a lot of Batman.
I mean, there's 7 decades of Batman.
Yeah.
I'm a big Batman person, not just comics, just Batman. I mean, we were love the animated series. Like I said, my kid's watching Batman Beyond right now, which is he's way too young to be watching it, but I was like, I don't fucking care. Let him. Yes, we don't do Batman because it's fucking Batman. There's so much Batman.
Not that we don't like Batman.
Right. That's my favorite thing.
It's just that, you know, literally everywhere else in the internet.
Yeah.
As far as like, yeah, Swamp Thing stuff, great. I'd love to actually talk about Alan Moore Swamp Thing first. before I get to like the deeper, because I think there's a lot of people that
you'll probably do a Swamp Thing video.
I will eventually at some point do something like that. I think it's one of the greatest comic books ever made. But I think a lot of people haven't read it.
Post Alan Moore though, what?
That stuff's cool too. And I don't know if he means like so it kind of kept going with you know, there's stuff by Mark Miller, there's stuff by Brian K. Vaughan, there's stuff by Scott Snyder done in the New 52 that's kind of like Alan Moore fan fiction. Then Charles Soule took over. People seemed interested in that. I don't know. Swamp Thing's been through a lot of different incarnations, but I mean, still, like Alan Moore is like number one. You could go pre-Alan Moore, talk about Bernie Wrightson, who actually created the character. There's a lot of stuff to talk about there, but I would actually like to talk about what makes that character anything.
Yeah.
And it'd be an interesting video because you could talk about the movies and stuff, but the sequel of which I can still remember watching when I was a kid. And I'm looking to revisit at some point or another to see how fucking bad it is.
Legends of the Dark Knight.
I've never read any of it, actually, to be honest.
Which, I mean, to be honest, I think, not that I read a lot of Batman. There was a time when I was trying to read all the Batman, because you had to read all the side stuff to get Batman, and it was the rebirth stuff and the traveling through time. But I like detective comics. Oh, I mean, I've always liked Paul Dini.
Paul Dini, yeah.
I mean, it's like, obviously, I watched the fucking animated series, but, like, no, I always like detective. Like, that's the stuff that gets me.
Grant Morrison stuff's my favorite Batman, and it's fucking weird, and I take it all its weirdness.
Because we talk a lot about, like, what the fuck, but at this point, I just watch it, I just read it and go, okay.
Yeah.
I like it, but I don't know why.
Yeah.
But I can articulate more of, like, you know, the cape and the cowl.
But if somebody could explain to you why, it would blow your mind.
That's the fun, yes, I like that I've read it so that someone else, like, you can go in and go, okay, here, now all those things you saw, let me go into a little more detail, and I'm like, oh, that's cool, but I mean... Just things like the Court of Owls.
Yeah.
You know, I like shit like that. Just kind of basic, just regular ass Batman stuff that bends the rules of, like, you remember Batman? You think about his history and his parents? Well, guess what? We're going to throw a fucking wrench in there.
Yeah.
Not, hey, there's actually another Batman underneath a layer of Batman.
Except nobody gave, like, the Court of Owls story. It's like, Bruce Wayne had a brother. And then it's like, everybody, no, it's like, no, he doesn't.
Right.
Like,
but
everybody's already forgotten about it. It's never going to get brought up again.
But it's fun, right? Like, it's like, oh, it's fun to do this because I'm not entrenched in it. But then you read things like.
Right.
You know, like Killing Joke and shit like that. But then, yeah, he said like the Morrison stuff. It's just like, okay, you're wearing purple now.
Yeah.
And there's black and red petals. And, oh, she's double-crossing. Oh, this is crazy.
As for having you on the podcast, unless you, like, live down the street from our super secret bunker location or something. I don't know how that would be a thing, but
we've talked about doing like a Skype with somebody, with Chad or someone, but that's like probably never going to happen. Yeah.
We'll keep it in the hopper.
Just the logistics of we're recording at like 11 o'clock on a Sunday night because I have to go to work tomorrow morning. Or no, it's Thursday.
It's not even close to Sunday.
We usually on Sundays. So yeah. Star Wars run with Alan Moore?
Devil Worlds? Not really read any Star Wars comics.
Except for the new, when it relaunched.
I did read quite a bit of those just to kind of keep up with people and stuff.
The 2016 relaunch stuff?
Yeah. The Darth Vader series is actually really good. It's better than any of the other ones. It's literally just like, what was Darth Vader doing? You just like watch him be like an evil badass. It's really cool. Actually.
Now that I watched the original movies, I'm like, I'm coming into that.
It's kind of neat. Like, it's sort of like, okay, but like between movies, he like found out about Luke, right?
Yeah.
Like that it was his son and stuff. And then he decides, like, you're watching Empire, he says, like, you and I will overthrow the Emperor. I'm like, when did you decide that? Right? He just kind of says it. So this is sort of this comic that's interesting.
Yeah, that's another thing about Star Wars. They're like, you turn to the dark side. Like, you can't just tell someone, hey, be bad. Be bad. You're going to like
me. Awesome.
No, but not even like, you're like,
it's awesome.
It just isn't a weird way of like, but you're being an asshole to me. Why would I want to be with you? It'd be one thing if you were enticing him, like, hey, look what I can give you, women and stuff. He's just like, hey, dick, join us.
It's supposed to be power. Like, you just, you know, it's more powerful.
I know. Right? He just has a bad job of it in that movie. So whatever. Palpatine, my butt. I'll give you some.
Palpatine sounds like something you put on your butt.
I was like, no.
To treat something.
No. What is it?
Did you try some Palpatine?
Oh, sorry. I was thinking about polyps. I got some polypatines. All right. Thank you. Question. Next email. I already went to the next email. I forgot what the name was. It was Doomfella, but I don't remember what his real name was. Zane? Yeah, it was Zane.
Thank you, Zane.
Matt writes in and says, hey, guys. Matt in Chicago here. I thought I'd write to you guys and tell you how much your YouTube channel and podcast kick ass. I hate telling you guys.
Did he write sigh? Like, he wrote sigh?
I hate having to tell you guys that you're so wrong, but... Yeah. There are so many shitty podcasts out there that sound like utter garbage and YouTube channels that put no effort into the production value that you guys make other videos look like the drizzling shit.
Wow. Wow. Drizzling shits.
I love that.
I imagine it's
I was taking umbrage with like, I think sometimes like we lose focus of like, we should be doing a podcast and be fun and do this. And sometimes like, oh, we just get into like, I'm going to talk for 10 minutes and you're going to talk for 10 minutes. Like sometimes I think we're shit because of that. But then there are times of like pure gold here. We forget what we're doing. We just get lazy.
I just can't get past drizzling shit. I'm imagining like a chef now, like putting in the last, like, well, like he's pinching his fingers and rolling them together.
I think more of what happened the other week when my kid was peeing.
Your kid actually drizzled some shits. Like
he was standing in front of the toilet. He was peeing in the toilet and he goes, ah, mama, I need you. And we always think, I'm like, hey, if you're going to call someone across the house, you need to say, what is it you need? And I think I went over there and I was like, oh, you shit yourself. Turns out he was trying to push out a fart and he just shit and it just
happens.
And when you say drizzling shit, it ran down his leg into his shorts. He's like, I can't move. It's going to get on the floor. My wife's like, it's already on the floor. You're not going to stop it. That was some drizzling shit.
God, you got to set up your dad cast.
Yeah, he's a great kid. He's annoying sometimes, but he does the funny. The way he talks, his hand motions, and the way he talks, he whatever. Drizzling shit.
So next time.
Yeah. So now he'll be like, he was like, is like, I farted. I'm like, oh, I heard that. He's like, and I didn't poop. Like now it's like if he pushes out a fart, I'm like, you better push it out on the toilet because you might poop yourself.
He'll get good self esteem growing up. Anytime he can.
I mean,
fart
they make mistakes. He's only four. They still have accidents, but it's hilarious. I came across the YouTube channel. Back to the email. I came across the YouTube channel looking for Predator comics to read, and I struck gold. I have listened to almost every podcast and watched every video within a week. I have two questions for you. The new Alien Covenant poster that was just released, what's your thoughts on it, and does it make you even more excited to see the new movie? Two, after watching the Preacher video, I was wondering what you thought of season one of Preacher. I thought it was a hit and miss, but the last couple episodes really stepped up in my opinion, and I'm looking forward to season two. You guys kick ass. Please keep the podcast coming.
Thank you.
Alien Covenant. We do this thing, not that we'd see nothing, but we generally like to black out.
Oh, I've seen the poster.
I have too. But just like the idea, like someone was talking on the fucking comments and be like, the Neomorph, I'm like.
Yeah, I didn't look at any of that stuff.
And I
ask us about that stuff.
I googled it and I went, oh shit, there is. I thought that was just making something up. We black ourselves out because you know what's going to happen? Covenant's going to come out and we're going to go see it the day it comes out and I want to go in going, I know nothing.
Yeah.
I just want to enjoy it and know. So, yes, there's an alien xenomorph on that poster. Okay. It's called Alien Covenant, so I guess there's totally xenomorphs. Like, not even like, hey, we're going to get to xenomorphs. Like, no, they're there. So I have nothing to say about it. It's just, yeah, there's it's there.
I'll say something. I thought the poster was great. I loved it. I love the spare.
Does it say run, though?
Just says run.
I don't like that because
I liked it.
You don't run from xenomorphs. They eat you.
Well, maybe in this one you do.
You can't outrun them. Like,
maybe they're like slow.
You should say bored at the windows.
Yeah. It's cool. It's visceral. And it reminds me of the other just in space, no one can hear you scream kind of thing.
It gives me the vibe, though, of like, hey, all you fucking idiots that were too good for Prometheus that thought you know, whatever, fine, here's your goddamn alien.
It makes me excited. That's the answer to that question. I like the poster, and yes, it makes me excited.
Anytime anyone makes another Alien or Predator movie, I'm excited.
Yeah.
I don't care if it's, like, Predators was not very good, but I was excited that someone made a movie, and then I saw it and was like, okay, well, I'm disappointed now.
Yeah.
I didn't get
really excited just because it had a xenomorph on it. I liked the tagline. I liked the...
Ridley Scott's making it. It's one of those things where you hear about directors who are like, yeah, I'm going to shoot this movie, this movie, this movie. You're like, yeah, sure, that'll ever get fucking done.
Looks like he's trying to make an even scarier movie than Prometheus, so I'm into it.
Yeah.
If that's the tone they're going for.
As long as someone actually is making the movie they said they were going to make, you know, like hearing that, you know, was it Scorsese or Danny Boyle, like, oh, I had this movie, but it's like, you know, the fourth movie I'm going to make from now. It's like, ugh, it's going to be years until I get to watch that.
Why don't you even fucking tell us that shit?
And then sometimes when you finally get around and it gets out, you're like, oh my God, yes, they finally made that movie. You know, it's exciting. So that's about it. First season's Preacher. Didn't watch it.
Can you remember where you and I were?
I watched the first episode.
Yeah.
And I immediately hated that fucking show, except for Cassidy. He was okay.
Yeah.
I didn't like it before the show came on when I was watching, like, the commercial, the preview stuff. I didn't like some of the casting and stuff.
Right.
I seriously tried, I think, maybe the second episode and went, why? I don't like this.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, maybe it'll come back. What it was is I wasn't watching it, but I was hearing. So, hey, I think, you watched it. How far did you get?
I didn't finish it.
But you got pretty far.
I saw like six, maybe like six or seven episodes.
So what happens, I asked you, hey, how is this going? What about this? And you're like, they're still in the town. I went, okay, fuck it. I'm deleting it off my DVR.
Yeah. I started out pretty positive. I actually did really like the pilot. And I didn't, you know, I thought some of the changes they're making were fine and stuff. There's some stuff that's just like kind of fundamental to the show that I have big problems with. I guess, spoiler, I don't fucking know. It's been out for a while now. The making his dad a preacher... making Jesse's dad a preacher that spanks him and like disciplines and stuff and like puts all the like religion, dogmatic religion and stuff on him. Nuh-uh. Sorry. Can't do it. There's some stuff like just on a character level I just have a huge fucking problem with. And just
and, like I didn't even watch it, but when you were telling me about the stuff, I was already going like, geez, I'm so glad I'm not watching it. Cause yeah, we agree. There's so much to Preacher that's, you know, the cowboy thing and the dad, and like there's so much more to it than just like here's a really cool fun comic.
Yeah.
And to hear that like they abandoned a lot of the things that were very fundamental to what made Preacher.
Yeah. And there's stuff like, you know, you have the bar fight scene, but the bar fight scene is now somebody picking a fight with him in a bar and him just kind of like being a badass and defending himself instead of in the comic, which is him going in there and being what Jesse Custer is, which is going in and sticking his finger in people's eye and telling you you're full of shit.
Yeah.
Like that's Jesse Custer. So there's stuff like that. You know, Tulip isn't Tulip.
Hey, say Jesus, or not say it, but what's Jesus backwards?
You mean like phonetically or like if I...
Not Jesus, but S-U-S-E-G.
C-Z-J.
Okay, what's God backwards?
Dog.
Sausage dog.
Okay.
Wiener dogs are the best.
Anyway, I'm not into it. I told myself I was going to finish the first season, but I don't know that I will.
Yeah, it's surprisingly how simple it was. Like, nope.
Maybe if the second season comes on and people, because they talked about it being like a prequel season, if the second season like kind of gets back on track or something, maybe. But it's been changed beyond too far beyond. I'm too much of a fan. I don't usually have that, and I feel bad because I feel kind of a hypocrite. I make fun of other people, like just let something stand on its own. Like you're just being a nerd about it. But I found something I'm a nerd about. Like I can't get past some of this stuff.
Sometimes something is so good that maybe you can make your own version that's good. But the idea that like this is okay. Like Jurassic Park the book is really good.
Yeah.
Jurassic Park the movie is really good. There are similarities. There's a lot of differences. But when something is like amazing and you're going to adapt it, like that's why I imagine Dark Tower. Well, even if you made Dark Tower the movie and it was good, but it was so far removed from Dark Tower the book, you're like, well, I can like it on its own, but it's not Dark Tower. It's something different. It has to match the amazingness of it, and Preacher is fucking amazing.
I would also say that beyond my nerd nitpicks, the show got really wheel spinny. You can't speak to this, but like after Tulip like tries to get Jesse Custer to get back to like a life of crime, after like the fourth or fifth time she's doing that, I'm like, okay.
So it's The Walking Dead.
It's The Walking Dead.
I don't know why I still watch that show. Thanks, Matt.
Thank you.
Please write in again for next time when we do another podcast, like 5-6 weeks from now.
That's about right.
Luke says, and I love this formatting of his email because it's just like two or three words and then a line break. Hey guys, love the show. Are there any work prints or fan edits you have particularly enjoyed? I don't know if any of that means.
Sorry. I think that the only fan edit that I can technically say I've watched is probably like the Star Wars Despecialized editions.
Okay.
So I'm not in the habit of watching fan edits.
Okay, I don't even know what that is.
I think they just mean like when you re-edit.
Like a work print or fan edit. Like the scary Mary Poppins trailer.
Maybe.
I don't know what that...
Maybe that's what he's talking about.
Feel free to write back in again for the next podcast.
You remember, like, we're old men that don't, like, know, like, all the fucking cool shit that all the kids are doing. I thought when he said fan edit, he meant, like I don't know, like fucking, like, Topher Grace, like, edited all the prequel Star Wars together and cut out all the bad shit, and it, like, turned into one good movie or something.
Why
like
Topher
that.
Grace?
I don't know. Because he's got the time and the money, I guess. I don't know.
Wait, did you literally just pull him out of a
hat? No, I think he did that.
Oh, okay. I love Topher Grace. He's awesome. And bonus, yeah, I don't work print. What is a work print? I don't.
Work print sounds like a movie thing.
I feel like an idiot that I'm supposed to, like, yeah. Understand this, and maybe it's just
you're assuming
us.
That we're smarter than we are.
I don't know. I just feel dumb that, like, I can't answer this because I don't know what that means.
Sorry.
Bonus question. Do you have any horror novel recommendations that aren't Stephen King books? Please keep up the great content. Please keep the great content coming. Thanks, Luke. Horror.
What reason?
I haven't read a lot of them.
Horror novel,
like,
recommendations.
Like, shitty horror novels? Like, yeah, I like...
Yeah, I read, like, read
the,
a lot of bad
I liked the Resident Evil books, but that's, Jesus. Again, I read those when I was a teenager.
Right.
But they're horror.
I mean,
they're...
you probably already read it, but World War Z is really good. Like, who hasn't read that?
Yeah. I read it before. It was cool, though.
How about this, just as, like, a bonus? It's not really what you asked for, but I'll give it to you anyway. So, the guy who wrote and directed Bone Tomahawk, right? Which is, like, a horror western, right?
Yes.
Well, he wrote a bunch of western novels.
Before that, yeah.
Okay? And I happened to read one of them called Raise the Broken Lands, one of the few books I've actually had a chance to read in the last, like, 2 years. It's really fucking good. It's not really a horror, but it's incredibly violent. So if you're looking for an incredibly
I like
violent,
how it's like, well, it's
the violence is horrific, kind of a action adventure western revenge book. That was great read.
I feel like I got caught up, like, when I found, you know, Stephen King at an age where I was like, I have time to read. I would just buy a bunch of Stephen King books.
Yeah.
I was never a big reader, like. Of like a little, I read a lot. Like, I found Michael Crichton. I'm like, okay, right. my books, Congo, and, you know, shit like that. Like, I was reading a lot of his stuff, so I didn't branch out very much.
Read, these are really obvious ones. Read Richard Matheson. Read I Am Legend.
I Am Legend. Yeah,
read,
I like
read
I Am
the
Legend.
Incredible Shrinking Man. It's not a horror book, I guess, per se, but great fucking book. Like, read Matheson for sure.
Trying to think of anything else that I've ever, like, read, and the list isn't. I mean,
I've not read anything.
I mean, because high school is, like, all literature and it's all stupid.
Yeah.
I think a lot of literature is dumb that they make you read in high school. It's like, I don't fucking care about The Great Gatsby.
I don't disagree with you.
But I mean, there are things that I liked. It's just that I don't. Oh, let's read foreshadowing. What does the color mean? I don't fucking care. I'm stupid. I mean, I'm not stupid.
Well, that's why you're supposed to give a kid.
I want entertainment and maybe, like, some real life emotion.
Well, I agree. You first get something you actually want to read, and then you can.
Yeah, I mean, like, All Quiet on the Western Front. Like, I'll read about, like, you know, war and shit. I'm not going to read War and Peace, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. They got nothing for you on that one. It's horror books. I don't know. Go to Amazon, type in horror book, and just see what comes up. I don't know. That's my recommendation.
I read, like, more science fiction books and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And like, Chuck, I was, like, reading, like, a Chuck Palahniuk and College and stuff like that. I'm looking more for those recommendations. So if you guys out there, like, have some, like,
wish I had time to read. I thought about, I'm reading a pretty good horror book right now called The Dumbest Kid in Gifted Class by Dan Reichert.
Right.
That's pretty much a horror book at times.
I was reading The People's History of the United States, which is all about how we... fucking murder
horrific.
And slaughter and subjugate people all over the planet, and that's kind of a horror book, so yeah. There you go.
All right. Jesse writes in, not really a question, but as a new comic reader, I'm always looking for recommendations on graphic novels / trade paperbacks / story arcs to read. Having picked up Gorillaz and Blackfire based on reviews, I would love to hear more of this style of content, but to be honest, I'm into just about everything y'all make and would gladly listen to you ramble about whatever. lucky for you, we have a rambly-ass podcast today. Thanks for the entertainment.
Yeah, except I don't have really time for me to ramble. I mean, you know, I got 10 million recommendations.
What's good?
I can't really. Everything's good. There's lots of good stuff. I'll tell you what, since
Ryan's going to recommend to you BPRD and Hellboy.
Yeah, right. That's a lot to chew.
Pride of Baghdad.
Pride of Baghdad is excellent. You know, there's so much good stuff. I'll tell you this.
Sandman.
Just, shut up.
Or Elephant Man.
Yeah, shut up. So, since you seem to have been so keen on the two overlooks that I've done already, the comic book ones, the next one that I plan to do is on a book called The Creep. So you can get ahead of that. It's a great little quiet. If you're in the mood for something, definitely completely change your pace. Very nihilistic, slower paced noir. That's fucking good. It's really excellent. It's sad. It'll break your heart. Up there with some of the best crime movies. I thought it was fantastic. So.
If we're gonna go to like. I mean, if you're a new comic reader and it's just kind of like, well, here's some of the classics. Like, there's a million, like, go to a website and find it. Here's the classics. But I mean, what I have read is very, not much. But I mean, like, we did Preacher, and Preacher was really good. For someone who, if I had more time and comics weren't so expensive, which it sounds funny to say that, but I mean, really, the amount of what you're getting, unless you're going to reread them multiple times, it's expensive to be into comics.
Yeah.
You know, $4 for something that lasts 15 minutes is like.
Well, that's for like actual monthly comics. Right. That is, it can be expensive.
And like
habit.
$20 for a graphic novel
it's
or 15.
It's not like that anymore. They've changed.
Like, I can spend, you know, I buy video games or go to the movies. And
I mean, after like, because everybody discounts and stuff. So, like, now you buy like a first volume of Image Trade after the discount's like $7 for the first volume. Each one's $15 after that. After the discounts, you're looking at like $10, $11. So it's not as much as it used to be. Like, you can actually read quite a bit. And
just for when you have
digital, the digital stuff now is like really cheap too. I don't really think there's a lot of like excuses to get into comic books.
Right, but I mean, like, we, from someone, me, I'm a new comic reader or whatever. I don't have time as much as I used to. But I mean, I really liked Transmetropolitan. That's a really cool series.
Yeah. It's fantastic.
That's, like,
talked about that.
You know, if you like science fiction, and like I said, we did Preacher. I really like the Terminator versus RoboCop stuff.
Yeah, that was great.
I mean, it's only 4 issues, but I thought it was fucking great. I like 4 RoboCop, and I like Terminator, and it was a really cool little mashup there.
You want another couple of random ones? I Kill Giants is something I'll do a video on eventually. It's a great coming-of-age graphic novel. They're making a movie out of it eventually. Joe Kelly wrote that. I think he's one of the best comic book writers, but he made $1 million on Ben 10. Stuff so
oh, right.
Doesn't really do comic books as much anymore. From Hell, I would tell you, like, a lot of people, like, there's a lot of stuff from Alan Moore, but like, if you want to read Alan Moore's best graphic novel, it's From Hell.
Yeah, you've mentioned that many times.
You really want to jump into something fucking, you know, like real shit. Go jump into From Hell.
But really, he's
I got another one I'm gonna do an overlooked on called The Hero by David Rubin. David Rubin's a Spanish artist who. He's getting some exposure over here. He's got like a lot of like higher profile books over here right now, but he's from Spain. And last year, or I think last year, they published over here this translated The Hero, which is a retelling of the Hercules mythos, which might sound really boring.
Yes, it does.
It's not.
Unless it's Hercules the animated series, I'm all into that shit.
Dude, he is like eating out guys' buttholes in that book. It is not boring.
That's not what I thought you were gonna say.
No, it's
now
like,
all I can do is picture Kevin Sorbo eating some guy's ass.
It's like it's the kind of thing that's like it'd be great like if you had like a college class or whatever, but you could not teach like the kid in the class. Like, nope. It's fucking violent, it's full sex. It's really cool. It's not like trying to be like period accurate or anything like that. It's just literally like people have iPods and kind of like tech, but it's also kind of old. It's just incredibly well drawn, perfect example of like visual storytelling with, you know, a guy who writes and draws his own stuff. That stuff's really good. And you can look out for he also did an adaptation of Beowulf, I guess, in the same fashion, which I haven't got a chance to see yet, and they're finally going to start publishing that stuff next year. I'm very excited based on what he did with Hercules. So,
but really, he's just going to say Sandman, Hellboy, BPRD.
Yeah, but you know, there's other places to go for the mainstream stuff.
Right.
Like for the, like, there's plenty of like the like top 10 and top
right, that's
20.
Why, like,
it's kind of get started
as a new
stuff,
reader.
So.
It's like you might not you have,
but sometimes
you know.
It's fucking cool to like start someplace that not everybody else starts.
Right.
You know, like, you know, I gave you like 6 suggestions, so
yeah.
That's plenty.
Whatever. Oh, that's what that noise was.
Thank you for the question.
Thank you, Jesse. I'll pee on this. Izzy, I'm just going to say that your email looks like it's trying to say I smell, whatever.
Okay.
Maybe you'll get that.
All right.
I don't want to say the whole thing, but it's just like the email just says I smell. Well, not the whole thing, but the part of it is. Anyways. Hey, what's up, guys? Happy holidays from San Antonio, Texas.
Oh.
happy holidays to you too. Been listening to you guys for about 6 months or so. I found y'all, like a lot of others, searching YouTube about alien and predator shit. That's why we did it, right?
Yeah, because I'm smart.
No, I was. You did the Fire and Stone stuff, and I was all about it. And then we did
top three aliens.
Understanding comics, because I was like, hey, we should probably talk about this stuff because I don't understand it. But then it was my idea to go back and do another alien video with the top three comics, and that worked out. So, cha-ching, me. I'll take credit for all that shit. Just
take credit for everything. It's what you're good at.
I'm like an arcade machine. Feed me your credits. I think one of your book reviews was the first thing I ever listened to. Might I add, I personally enjoy listening to you guys talk about alien and predator stuff more than the guys that are purely dedicated to that stuff. So kudos to you. See, that's what I like too. It's kind of like...
I know we don't know like as much about that I don't wanna, stuff I'm, as like other...
I'm not shitting on anybody right now, but you told me like AVP Galaxy is a boring-ass podcast.
I listened to it though.
Right.
And that I hope they like.
That's what I'm saying.
I think some of them like listen to our stuff. I'm like a huge fan. You guys are great. You guys are obviously amazing. And huge kudos to you guys because you featured our first video I'm just also assuming that they're listening, but just in case they are,
right.
You guys featured our first video on AVP Galaxy, and that was like a huge boost in numbers for us. That got us a lot of first time eyes and stuff.
Yeah.
And they know everything about that stuff. They are clearly the authorities on the subject and clearly the biggest fans and know all about that stuff.
Which is nice because I reference that shit a lot when I go through look for things. And...
Every different structure, different folks. We're more colorful, maybe laid back, more loose with it. But we also probably like say 15 things that are wrong, you know, when we're talking about it.
Nothing is wrong within these walls.
Right.
Everything we say is the truth.
Yeah.
So yeah,
but thank you for the compliment.
I don't listen to them, but you've said you've it's like
it's a little dry. They're a little dry and it's a little dry and a little British.
Yeah. All right. First off, thank you for talking about Twin Peaks. Netflix recommended it a few times, and after hearing you guys talk about it, I gave it a try. Forever grateful. I'm so happy.
Wait, for which one?
Twin Peaks.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah,
good for you.
Yeah,
I'm so
golf club. Hey,
yeah, golf club for ourselves, right?
Yeah.
Credit for me. More credit. Give me an arcade machine. Just point those coins at me. I'm glad anyone can find something that we... Because we're not selling anything.
Yeah.
You know, we're not like, hey, this thing is really good. Buy it from us because we're trying to make money on it. Like, we're just like, hey, I really like this thing. I think you people might like it if you like this shit. Yeah.
That's especially cool when you step outside, you know, like Twin Peaks is fucking weird.
Because that's what we do with each other. Like, you'll tell me like, hey, try watching this thing.
Yeah.
You know, you might, this isn't normally, but I'm telling you that I like it. I know that you could, you know, that kind of thing. It's like, hey, you know, here's another zombie movie. You're like, hey, here's this thing you've never thought about, but I think you might like it because I know you know. We haven't even, I'm almost done with this Twin Peaks video. Okay. It's going to be like another week or so, depending on how my work schedule is. Here's a few things I wouldn't mind you guys hearing talking about. I guess there's this kind of subgenre of really, really gory Asian cinema. Oh God, I love this email.
Okay.
I want to be best friends with Izzy. Like Ricky O, the story of Ricky.
Oh my gosh.
Parentheses says, if you haven't seen it, watch it now. No.
Yeah, we've seen it.
Don't worry. I fucking know all about Ricky O. That's why if you watch Ip Man 2 and 3, it's hard because, you know, there's not like a great IMDb for Hong Kong cinema. A lot of it's just been lost to time. The bad guy / guy who turns a good guy in the Ip Man series of Donnie Yen is the dude from Ricky O.
Yeah.
There's bullets in here or whatever.
They're souvenirs.
Yeah. Yes, I fucking love Ricky O. Battle Royale, which obviously...
Yeah.
Machine Girl, which I think I watched.
I've actually never seen Machine Girl.
Machine
Girl
is the one that I saw kick.
That was a little too modern for Japanese.
Machine Girl is the one where she has a gun for a leg or a gun arm.
You're thinking of
Robert Rodriguez stuff. Yeah, but I think, that they have that.
Yeah, it's something like that.
Or she has a saw on her arm.
I mean, that stuff, that's like ridiculous shit. That's like.
I watched Kick Girl or High Kick or something like that.
Yeah.
But I understand the genre. I want to look it up real fast because I feel like I've watched this and I've forgotten about it. Machine Furl. Nope. Got to learn how to spell better. Machine Girl. Shyness Machine Girl. Machine Girls. The Machine Girl. 2008. That's probably what it is. Because it looks... Oh, she has a Gatling gun for an arm.
There you go.
I did watch this many moons ago, and I don't remember it. I remember Tokyo Gore Police. I watched that, too. All right. Sorry. Back to the email. Ninja Assassin, which... Ninja Assassin.
I wonder if that's... That sounds like an older samurai movie, actually. I don't know. I'm not sure about that one.
Isn't Ninja Assassin the one that the Wachowskis did? Or is that just called Ninja? No, yeah, that's the one that the Wachowskis did.
Okay.
Or, sorry.
Well, they, like, produced or some shit.
Unless maybe you're talking about James Mateague.
Yeah, okay, never mind.
Yeah, they produced it?
I remember that movie.
That movie had like special effects. I didn't like it.
Yeah.
I thought it was bad, but some of the stuff was funny in it. Whatever. They're all just kind of over-the-top violent Asian movies, and I really enjoyed hearing you guys talk about Kung Fu movies and Seven Samurai. Also, I know you guys mentioned before you don't really want to do the troll movies, but you got to talk about the troll movies, Troll 2 at least, which is the one with, you know Troll 2, right?
You know, I've heard it 10 million times. I just...
There's like the video of the guy who's like reacting to someone's death. He's just like, what? No. It's bad. It's some of the worst shit ever. Which does not seem to have any correlation with the first Troll movie. There's also a surprisingly good documentary named Best Worst Movie that kind of revisits the director and the cast about 20 years later. It gets really awkward and uncomfortable at times, but it's worth a watch. I want to watch that.
All right.
I've been watching a lot of Return of the Living Dead special features. I'm going to watch more of that. Last, given that we're at the end of 2016, I'd like to hear about what movie shows you guys like this year. Things that stand out to me were Ash vs. Evil Dead, which is why I asked you. Westworld for shows. I really enjoyed Arrival, which that means you didn't have to skip the spoiler parts.
There you go.
Looking forward to Rogue One, but keeping my expectations low. Also, maybe what movies you guys are looking forward to 2017. Looking forward to Covenant, Skull Island, hoping for the best, expecting the worst. Anyways, keep up the good work. Looking for the next podcast. God, I don't fucking...
A lot of whole bunch of stuff there.
Yeah, so. Well, also, I can't remember what year movies come out in, because I always watch them on... I don't go to the theaters very much at
all.
Yeah,
I don't...
Kids.
Right, I don't... Well, I don't either.
I fucking loved Ash vs. Evil Dead. Yeah. I thought every episode... You watched the first one, and you were like, does it keep up this, you know...
I thought that was such a great first episode. It's hard for me to imagine that...
And that's when I was like...
not being directed by Sam Raimi would still measure up to that.
And then I said to you... All the other 9 episodes are just as good.
Okay,
at least I think so. I mean,
right.
Some of them
are. Well, even if they were, even if like, I mean, I'm just saying, like, if it's still like in the
90% that way,
yeah, like that's pretty good.
I was bummed when it was over.
Yeah,
I was like, I want to watch more of this. It's I cannot believe they recaptured true Ash Bruce Campbell, Evil Dead. They did such a good job of capturing that. Like you talked about the remake not being right there. Lightning in a bottle did it again.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You didn't watch Westworld, but I did.
I'm going to. Now that it's all over, I'll probably end up watching
it. So I can't say, like, any fucking... I can't even give, like, a little mini review.
It's good.
I literally can't answer your question.
Say it's good. That's all I gotta say, right?
I'll say it's good. Sure.
Oh, wow. It's not that good?
Well, it's not perfect.
God, I don't know. I watched The Wire this year, which is not from this year. It's from quite a few years ago.
Yeah.
I liked 11/22/63. That was a really good 8-part miniseries.
Yeah,
the Stephen King thing. It was on Hulu, I think. Mm-hmm. It's really good, actually. People don't like James Franco, and I can understand that sometimes. But the story itself, just everything it does, is very good. I like
it. It's hard for you to remember what came out like this last year, you know?
Right.
Like, sort of a blur. OJ Made in America, fucking amazing. Really, really incredible documentary. Like, I'll watch that again in my life. Shit, I'm trying to remember. I don't even know. I told you all the movies I watched this past week.
Like, I don't even know what we saw. What I went to the movies, I saw Arrival in theaters.
There's a lot of stuff I didn't see. There was, like, movies that I came out that I, you know, like, wanted to go see. And some of the ones that I did go see, like, I remember not being, like, can't even remember what came out this past fucking
year. I didn't see Blair Witch.
Oh, okay, so here we go. I saw The Witch. The Witch.
I'm kind of too scared to watch The Witch.
It's not that scary. You need to watch it. It's so fucking good. I thought it was great. Fantastic. And now that I think about it, I watched another horror movie. I don't know when it came out, but somebody lent it to me last year called Goodnight Mommy.
Just stop talking. That sounds bad.
It's not. It's like evil children movie. It's not.
Oh,
like,
that's even worse. Great.
Yeah,
thanks.
But it's not, you're scared of ghosts and stuff. That's not.
I'm
you know,
scared of the dark.
There's no. Like, it all takes place during the day. You don't have to worry about
my
it.
My kid keeps making me check underneath his bed before I put him to bed now.
Yeah.
Dad, I need another nightlight in my room. Why? It's dark over there and I can't see.
All my favorite movies I remember coming out in 2015, so I'm having a really hard time right now thinking about what came out in 2016.
I feel bad just because, yeah, we just don't have a list in front of, like, what came out this year, but I'll be honest, I go to the movies 2 to 3 times a year because I just can't make it out there anymore. Did we go to the movies together this year? No.
No, not really. I talked about Roar. I talked about Green Room is definitely, I have to, like, look and see, like, what came out in 2016 movies-wise, But I'm pretty certain that Green Room is definitely in. You know, I'm just going to fucking look at a list really quick.
I kind of spent my year looking up, like, watching stuff that was stuff that I had missed. Like, I watched Winter's Bone this year.
Okay, Batman vs. Superman was a big piece of shit.
Why is this images? I want to see like a list.
I didn't see Deadpool.
Okay,
and I don't want to.
Captain America: Civil War, great. I guess I saw it along with everybody else.
Yeah, I'm looking at like the list of like what movies came out this year. I haven't watched any of this shit.
Zootopia was charming, but a mess in my opinion. We're gonna skip Ghostbusters. Deadpool was good.
I enjoyed it. I really liked 10 Cloverfield Lane.
I did too. Was that actually last year though?
It says 2016.
I thought you didn't like. No, I like it.
Oh, you just didn't like the ending.
I even don't hate it. I just think that it's like, I think it spoils what it was doing a little bit. But
I mean, I'm assuming that's a movie a lot of people saw. But I think 10 Cloverfield Lane is a fantastic movie.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, great little like Twilight Zone.
I'd like to hope that I think that it was small enough that like if I'm telling you right now, you haven't seen it, so go fucking see 10 Cloverfield Lane.
Right.
It's a great movie.
The Nice Guys, great.
Hey, Purge election year was this year, I guess.
There you go.
It's all right.
I saw Doctor Strange. That was fine. X-Men Apocalypse is terrible. I saw Hail Caesar. That's fun. Totally worth a watch.
I didn't know Kung Fu Panda 3 was this year. Okay, so I love Kung Fu Panda. I cry when I watch that movie because I'm such
Same
into
here.
Kung Fu
Me
shit,
too.
Right? You know, and those guys, you could tell they loved what they, you know, they knew what they were doing. Kung Fu Panda 2?
Yeah. Yeah, it's not good.
Not so much. Let my kid watch Kung Fu Panda 3 quite a few times. I hadn't even sat down. I was like, you know what? I should sit down and watch this. It was really good.
Really?
Really good.
So is this the one with the
all other
panda families in it? Like, okay.
Yeah, it's actually really good.
Okay. All right. I'll give it a shot.
It has two dads. Like, it's a good movie. I really like Kung Fu Panda 3.
So speaking of animated movies, I saw Kubo and the Two Strings. That was really good. I enjoyed that quite a bit. You're shrugging. You have no soul. I saw The Accountant. It was a fun, pulpy movie with some interesting things. I would actually looking forward to a sequel.
I want to watch The Accountant, but I mean, that's one of those guilty pleasures.
It's a
like,
fun
I
movie.
Just, I'll
it's
watch it by myself, you know.
I saw Everybody Wants Some. I thought that was great. That's definitely one of the best movies I saw this
year.
Which
one is that again?
It's a Richard Linklater movie. Same guy did Dazed and Confused. So it's like Dazed and Confused. Have you never seen Dazed and Confused?
No.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right.
They keep getting younger. I mean, I know part of like, you know, what it is and stuff.
It's just a movie about young people.
Right.
Maybe you'd hate it, but I thought it was really good. I didn't see Jason Bourne, 10 Cloverfield Lane. We talked about Hell or High Water. I wish I had seen. I guess it's coming out in...
Have that on my queue.
Wow, I did not see anything. I saw Hacksaw Ridge. It's a really fucking violent religious movie. There you go. It's a Mel Gibson movie.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to Dunkirk.
I am too. I'm
I mean,
for
it's one of these. So, like, Christopher Nolan is like, obviously, you watch his movies because, like, Inception and Interstellar,
right.
And the Batman movie's like, oh, it's gonna have some big thing. This is just literally like, I just meant to make a World War II movie. So it seems like, oh, this is like non-traditional Nolan, but I don't fucking care.
Right.
I know he's gonna make a good movie. It doesn't need to be about like some guy finds a space portal in World War II to win the war. I just want to watch a good.
Oh, I saw Sausage Party.
I watched like 5 minutes of it, and I'm mixed on it. I'm like, I think it looks funny, but also not funny.
I don't actually think that it was funny, but I
you
appreciate
told me
that it had a
shit.
Fucking message and stuff. It was so fucking weird.
Yeah.
I feel bad because it's like you would want me to like talk about like the cool, interesting movies that came out last year, but like I'm gonna be honest with you, like I don't get out to see them.
Right.
You know, if I get out to the movie theaters, it's so seldom that I do that it's gonna be to see like the bigger movie that I'm not gonna care about as watching at home.
I end up just watching a lot of movies that I missed over the years, like Universal Soldier.
Right.
You know, like it's definitely not new.
So you know, yeah, I didn't see The Handmaiden because I wasn't gonna get to see it because I will catch that on home video when it comes out.
2017. What do we got? Yeah, Alien Covenant?
I don't fucking know. Everything he said, I'm excited. Like, I'm excited for Kong Skull Island, sure.
Yeah.
I don't know what else is coming.
I don't care about Kong.
I fucking suck at this stuff now, you know? I don't really know what comes out or anything.
It's kind of, but that's the media blackout. I kind of like, oh, this movie's coming out in 3 weeks. Cool, I want
to
see that.
Yeah.
You know, I let myself
like,
be surprised.
Things that I've like, seen trailers for recently or whatever.
I don't
excited for a new Scorsese movie. That's cool. Even if it's not like the best movie ever made, I'm excited to watch it. Silence?
Don't even know. See? I think that... People go so crazy watching the trailers and the screenshots and all the shit, and like especially they talk about that with Star Wars. Like they release so much information. Like, how can you enjoy the movie when you see it? You've already seen the fucking movie. It is so much better when you just get to go through life and go, oh, I found this cool thing.
Yeah,
you know, and not like pour over it before it happens and before it shows up. It's on your doorstep one day and you're like, this is great.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm excited for the Lego Batman movie. I think it looks funny.
I'm gonna take my son to that.
Yeah, shit, I don't know.
Yeah,
John Wick 2, that's next year.
Is that next year?
I think
that's probably number one for me then. Yeah, we suck at this because we don't do any research ahead of time. We just read the emails, and it's like, oh, I didn't have anything ready for this.
Yeah, we're not the news site, so
yeah,
it's kind of hard to.
Speaking
it's
of,
it's not a bad question. It makes us think about it.
The Asian, the subgenre of Asian gory movies.
Just go watch Takashi Miike movies.
Yeah, I mean that's been around.
I don't really like that stuff. It's funny, like you put those movies together, but like Rikkyo is a Chinese movie.
Yes, but they're also silly. There's stuff that are funny,
right?
And then there's like the Miike stuff is like dark. And violent.
Of everything that was mentioned in that, that's not true. I love Battle Royale.
So if you want to see a guy get punched, like uppercut, underneath the chin, but then the fist goes through the chin and out the mouth and then rips the chin off, go see Rikkyo. If you want to see a guy smash another guy's head with his hands and then some guy thrown into a meat grinder at some point and an awesome dance sequence by the fire outside, do you remember this?
Are you talking about
Rikkyo?
Oh, okay.
There was just like a bonfire, and he's like dancing in the ring. Rikkyo is that. That needs to be on a pedestal somewhere of like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
It is amazing.
Right.
It is so good.
Agreed.
We watched Rikkyo at the new Beverly Cinema with John Landis and Edgar Wright.
Well, Edgar Wright was hosting it. John Landis just happened to be in the audience, which was kind of cool.
No, we were walking outside. We're like, oh.
There's John Landis.
Hey, John Landis.
He wears his bow tie everywhere.
yeah, that's when we gave Edgar Wright pizza. And then the costume contest. It was a Halloween thing. And it was like, oh, costume contest. And the winner was Alec Baldwin.
He said I'm Alec Baldwin from Beetlejuice.
Because
he had a sheet over him. Because
Everyone thought, I was like, oh, it's just a kid. Like, oh, he's just wearing a sheet with the eyes cut out. And then did the Beetlejuice bit. And everyone lost it. That was amazing.
It was pretty funny. Yeah, it's good stuff.
Oh, that was funny. Watching, we watched Shaun of the Dead and then Rikkyo, the story of Ricky. Yeah. I don't know if there are other. I haven't watched too many of those, but I'm trying to think of any other. Biozombie. I don't think that's really gory, but I remember Biozombie being.
It's a fun movie. It might be a little antiquated now.
Oh, yeah,
but,
totally.
It's pretty fun. So, what are we talking about? Just like kind of gory, fun, like
Asian movies? Trying to think.
God,
he already said a lot of the best ones.
Right. You gotta be careful. You go down that rabbit hole. Some of that stuff gets too fucked up, and I can't handle it anymore. But this was kind of funny, goofier ones.
Because you already said the Miike stuff, which is
Which is weird.
Audition.
Of it's money. Yeah, but that's not goofy. That's a fucking scary movie.
Yeah, but it is. Yeah.
But if you want to watch a goofier one, Ichi the Killer's fucking strange and weird, and nipples getting cut off and stuff. And
I'm trying to think of any Chinese. I mean, they're not really gory.
Again, this isn't silly, but
Mr. Vampire. I love Mr. Vampire.
There you go.
That's not gory at all, but it's a silly, over-the-top, stupid Chinese vampire movie. It's my I love Mr. Vampire.
For Japanese stuff, I actually didn't really ever get that. I really like the older movies. I watched a bunch of the older movies, but I watched some Miike and got into the horror stuff a little bit, and then I got kind of tapped out. It's weird and crazy and shocking, but I don't really think they're good movies. But Audition is really good.
I'm at a loss because I think
a lot of the movies, the Korean movies that we mentioned, are incredibly fucking violent. But they're also
the Chaser
movies.
Is a very
That's a fucked up movie.
That is, again, they're not over the top though. They're very serious. Yeah.
Do you ever watch the Three Extremes? With the three horror shorts?
I know what it is, and I feel like I did, but I don't remember.
Because it was Takashi Miike made one, and so did Park Chan-wook, and then I don't remember the name of the Chinese filmmaker, and he did the one that was the eating fetuses and stuff like that. That was the Chinese one.
Then I did not watch that then, because I would probably remember that.
Yeah, you probably remember that. Those were interesting.
Just as far as Asian cinema, we've already said, we want to do stuff on Asian cinema, but there's so much to try to figure out what we want to do with it, because I have gone down that rabbit hole and I've watched I have watched way too much that I forget a lot of it,
Yeah. Hey, I'll tell you,
But let's also do I want to help you find undiscovered gems, or do I want to help you what's mainstream?
I don't know that we know enough about you probably know enough about Kung Fu that you could do that.
No, I mean
know.
Every all
yeah,
all
I don't know that we know
it's
enough
just,
about it.
It's like if I say go watch SPL, that guy was actually pretty mainstream. But if I say go watch PTU, to me, PTU is a mainstream movie, but it's probably not. So if I do a video on it,
a lot of people's
It's actually not that mainstream. So I don't know where to draw the line as far as everybody else.
I'll tell you one thing, it's not a horror thing, but since you're on the topic, if you really like Battle Royale, that's Kenji Fukasaku. And before he did that stuff, he did a whole series of very successful Yakuza movies that were very influential and stuff like that called the Yakuza Papers. Watch those. They're really cool. That's
yeah.
it.
I'm trying to think, like, because a lot of the older kung fu stuff, it's the blood and stuff. It's not. I mean, obviously, it's not over the top, but yeah, I don't know. For the far as the gory stuff, I don't know. The other stuff will have to.
What was that one that, like, the baseball movie where it was like they're monsters and they fought each other and
Battlefield Baseball.
Yeah,
I think is what it is.
That one's pretty fucking weird and gory.
It's like
and
zombies
stuff.
And yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I just hate that I keep wanting to do some kind of Asian cinema stuff, and I just don't know.
Get away from the Asian stuff. Go watch, if you haven't seen it already, go watch Dead Alive. Okay? Go watch Peter Jackson's, early. Like, you want to see a real fucking splatter, gory, like, funny thing. You know, obviously, I'm assuming you've already watched the Evil Dead movies, but, like, if you've already seen those, like, watch the Peter Jackson movie.
I feel like I watched something recently that was a ridiculous horror, gory thing, and I don't remember what it was. And it was silly like Dead Alive was, but I don't remember what it was now. I don't know. All right. Thank you, Izzy. We should be best friends. Last email, because we're going on way too long, and we've just been fucking babbling forever, from Deadhead. Hey, guys, what do you think of the Thing movies? Also, there's more than one?
There's only one.
Well, if you want to take, like, the remake, the Thing from Outer Space, like the actual black and white.
Okay, fair.
And then there's the remake
saying, you're talking about the John Carpenter remake and the original film.
The black and white, and then the 2011 one.
No, there's just those two movies. And they didn't make another one, I don't think.
What are you talking about? Are you trying to be funny?
I guess so.
Okay.
I ain't going to watch that shit.
Which would win? Xenomorph or The Thing? Okay, so quickly, I remember watching The Thing from Outer Space as a kid, the black and white one, and I think it's pretty good. I haven't watched it in a long time, but I remember thinking it was...
It's Howard Hawks movie, right? I don't know. It's a guy who makes a lot of westerns.
Who doesn't love The Thing?
I know. I mean, who at this point?
I've watched it so many times at the end to watch them talk and who got the bottle.
Everybody's all about, like, oh, I found out politically you're this, so I'm not going to ever talk to you again. Like, nah, just if somebody doesn't like The Thing, I mean, you can, you know, they're probably a thing. right? I mean, who doesn't like that fucking movie? It's one of
the... Not even who doesn't like it. I mean, it does everything that, yeah. It's,
even if you
so
don't
good.
Like it, you have to say, like, oh, yeah, right. No, that's one of the landmark, you know...
I mean, getting a guy who's a W amputee in the arms to, you know, get his fake arms ripped off in the chest of a big, you know, monster thing, like, that movie's awesome.
I mean, you take somebody as John Carpenter, who is influential as he has been to a genre and to film as in general, and then say, okay, and that's his best movie, probably.
Yeah,
so,
and the music, obviously the music in the movie is like, that's something like my dad introduced me to.
Yeah.
Like, my dad's a piece of shit in many ways, but like, he did introduce me to a lot of cool things like that, and The Thing is the boom, 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 like that is great. That stuff will never, like, no one will ever be able to top things like that.
I will say this.
What?
I have not seen the original movie. I have not seen the prequel, remake, whatever the fuck that thing is. I'm not going to, I don't think I'm ever going to watch that. I played The Thing video game from beginning to end.
That's what I thought about when that came up. I'm like, you and that PS2 game, which I tried to play for a while, but
it's a hard fucking game to play, but I did some cool shit. I don't regret that time.
I watched The Thing remake because I'm, like, kind of in love with Mary Elizabeth Winstead. So
that's got something going for it.
I think that movie wasn't bad. I think they did some interesting things with the idea of, like, when and where it took place, because it's, if I remember correctly, it's basically a sequel. Not a reboot, because they find the station and stuff after, or maybe it is a reboot, because they find, like, the Dutch guys, whatever. It wasn't that bad. She did an okay job. It seemed a little ridiculous at times. I'm like, well, why this person, that, whatever. It had the guy in it who was in Jane Got a Gun and Warrior, and what fucking movie is he in that anyone's going to know what I'm
talking
about?
I know what you mean. Yeah, I know what you mean.
What is he?
I don't know his name.
Is he in Zero Dark 30?
No, that's another guy.
I know it's not him, but I'm thinking was he one of the other guys? He's in a military movie, isn't he? At some point?
Probably.
He's not Tom Hardy in Warrior. He's the other brother. He's like the high school teacher who does MMA.
Yeah.
He's in it, and there's a really cool scene at the end of the movie, the Thing remake. Once they go on, like, the ship, that's when it gets to, like, God, fuck this movie, because it's like, ooh, there's a big alien on the alien ship. The alien ship is huge, and it's all special effects, and it's stupid, and everything leading up to, like, the suspense stuff is pretty okay. They're riding out on one of those, like, snowmobiles, but, like, a tractor with a snowplow. And, you know, they're kind of getting along, and they're liking each other, and they're like, well, basically we're committing suicide at this point. Like, we just got to try to kill this thing and save the day. Even if we have to die, we die, whatever. But they make it out. And then she's getting back in the thing, and he's like, oh, we made it. And she's got the flamethrower, and she's like, oh, I can't remember when she says something like, oh, can you, you know, pop the thing and to distract him, like, you know, pick up this thing or go hit the headlights button. And he looks back and she's got the flamethrower pointed at him. He's like, hey, what do you, why? Hey, calm down. And what it was is he had an earring in. And she asked him something about, like, because remember, like, the teeth fillings are metal and it can't do that. And so she realized that the little tiny dot earring that he'd had in that he like, would touch it sometimes. She'd asked him, like, oh, what happened to your, you know, whatever. And he touched the wrong ear. Mm. And that's what he knew. And at that point, as a movie not being that great, but it's an okay, and then obviously the original is way better. As the audience member, I go, oh, damn it. I thought they were going to make it together. Now, like, he's bad, and she's going to have to burn his ass. Like, it obviously did something to make me care. Even if the movie wasn't great, it did something, because at that point, I was, like, bummed out. I was like, oh, shit.
It's such a bummer, because, like, all anybody ever actually wanted was a fucking sequel. Right. And it's too bad that, you know.
Which is what the video game was.
Right. That's why I like it. Games was cool. But then that, you know, the original movie, like, came out to, like, bad reviews. Nobody saw it. Like, it was a failure. It, like, found a voice, like, on home video or whatever, yeah. Right? It's kind of a bummer that just, like, wow, still? Like, we're not, you know? Like, you would do a sequel to any other, like, big landmark movie, but, like, not this one.
But then you have things where, like, you can't make a sequel to it because it's supposed to end there and be ambiguous and have that great, you know, ending. You don't pick.
You just don't do that.
Last of Us 2. You want
to
talk about,
like, you have them come to the base and they're gone. They're not there, you know?
Yeah, just always leave it a mystery. Or, you know,
you should always be left a mystery.
It's always good. Like the blob, the end question mark, question mark, you know?
One more thing. there's a band called Zombie Zombie.
I thought you were going to say the March of the Mental Man.
They do like, no. they do like kind of like John Carpenter-esque, like kind of synth pop kind of stuff. And they have a music video that's essentially stop motion, like G.I. Joe reenacting the Thing movie. That's pretty fucking cool. The song is called, I think, Driving This Road Until Death Sets You Free or some shit like that. I think it's really fucking cool. That's all.
At this point, nobody's listening, so it's crazy.
All right.
No one's going to hear that.
Last question?
If we're talking about John Carpenter, we should talk about the Big Trouble Little China music video, right?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Really?
No.
I knew of this, and I forgot about it, and then, of course, Dan Reichert decides to talk about it. There's a music video for Big Trouble in Little China, the song.
You mean like when the movie came out, there was a music video for it?
Yes.
Okay.
Starring John Carpenter.
Okay. No, I didn't know that.
It is phenomenal.
Right.
In all 80s glory.
Yeah, they put all these things in the show.
Big Trouble, Little China. Like, it's so bad.
Okay.
It's so good. It's so bad. It's drunken John Carpenter, and he knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
Like, he made the music. He's in the video. He made the movie. Wait, sorry. Big Trouble in China is John Carpenter, right?
Yes.
Yeah, sorry. I was just like, brain fart. It's so a product of the era. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
Xenomorph or The Thing?
Oh, I don't
Who
know.
Wins? Whatever. The Thing.
Yeah.
Because can it take over it Xenomorph?
Just, I assume so.
He's like, acid blood. He's like, fuck you.
Yeah, acid blood. Fuck you. Stab you. Fuck you. Like, what? I don't know what.
You can stab me with your tail, and I'll just eat that shit.
Yeah. But they don't like fire, right? That's right. So
neither do xenomorphs, right? Flamethrower.
Yes, yeah.
Now, what the fuck is a xenomorph thing? A thenomorph? A thingomorph?
A thingomorph?
That's some scary shit.
I guess it is, yeah.
Because that is, that's something I don't want to see that in a movie, because that scares me.
It's just, yeah, I don't know. Somebody do it.
Fan fiction.
Draw that shit.
And that's going to do it. For this episode of the Alphacast, we went.
I'm gonna pee my pants.
Yeah, even I feel pretty crazy about that. Obviously, I'm gonna cut some of this down with silence truncating it, but like we are well over 3 hours.
Yeah, we had a lot to talk about.
Like my wife asked me, "Hey, how long are you gonna be there?" And I say, "You know, if I tell you an hour, it's gonna be like 5." So I just go, "You know, I don't know. It's probably gonna be long."
Yeah,
that's all I can say. It's probably gonna be long. It's past midnight. It's been a long time since we've talked. We haven't seen each other in a while. Anyway, it's been a while since we've done one of these, so hey, I hope you like listening to us ramble for 3 fucking hours.
I didn't know you're still recording.
Oh, no, it's still going.
Yeah.
Anything you want to, any words of wisdom you want to impart before we leave?
I'm going to go home and watch a movie in bed. I haven't done that in a long time.
Let's go to sleep. I have to get up for work in 6 hours.
That's the beauty of it, is I can fall asleep if I want to.
I fucking hate you.
I didn't make you have kids.
Yeah, kids are kids. So, it's coming soon, Twin Peaks, Alien vs. Predator.
I think I'm going to get done with mine before you get done with yours.
No, you're not. I'm almost done.
I'm going to be more than halfway done by the end of this weekend. So
end of this weekend? Okay. Are you going to work? Because she's gone
all weekend.
You got all weekend. Yeah. So we're probably not going to do one of these. I mean, honestly, we're going to be spending We're going to do that Resident Evil 2 playthrough hopefully this month. Hopefully you're going to find some... I mean, we need a couple hours, like 4 or 5 hours to be able to have...
You can get it done. Time. Well, holidays and stuff, we'll see.
Because we're going to be watching Resident Evil movies in January and then going to the movies in January. So I don't know that we're going to...
I can't guarantee that I'm not going to want to play Resident Evil 4 with all that stuff. I mean, if you want to. I've been thinking about it anyway.
I've almost bought it.
Just to like, make me feel better.
I almost bought it again on Steam.
To play a video game to escape your life, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I was like, God, that sounds like just turning my brain off for like 8 hours. Maybe I will.
See, but I only play it for like an hour, 2 hours, like in one night.
Well, yeah, not in one sitting, but.
I mean, sometimes I spend like, I go to bed a little late and I spend 3-4 hours, yeah. But I don't do the like, hey, I'm going to, you know, I'll play this game over a couple of weeks. I don't have time to power through shit anymore. But so we're going to be doing a podcast on Resident Evil series movies. Yep. In January, so I don't know that we're going to...
Something else comes up that we want to do.
I don't know that we're going to have, like, any time or room for an Alphacast probably until, like, February.
Yeah.
Unless we just, like, try to schedule one in early January.
Know. Maybe you'll watch one of these other movies that I watched and we can talk about it.
Yeah.
I think you're gonna like, really, really like Green Room.
I hope so. So, this has been...
This has been another Alphacast.
Episode 8.
Brought to you by Alpha Rookie.
And we're here, and we're going to bed. Good night.
Good night.